The Whiskey Throttle Show, now available on the Spot Network, an independent standalone streaming platform, live now on Apple TV, Roku, Amazon Fire, Google Play, Android TV, most smart TVs, and all phones and tablets. Look for future live shows and specials only available on Spot Network. Download the app today on your favorite device. Coming to you from the Troy Lee Design Saloon in Corona, California, it's the Whiskey Throttle Show, brought to you by Yamaha, the leaders in the power sports industry. Motocross bikes, street bikes, adventure bikes, generators, side-by-sides, quads, boats, Yamaha sets the standard. Yamaha revs your heart. Today's guest is presented by PowerDot, the world's smartest muscle recovery and performance tool. PowerDot takes proven electronic muscle stimulation technology and packs it into a sleek, lightweight, easy-to-use pod that is completely controlled from your smart device. Today's show brought to you in part by Method Race Wheels, the strongest, lightest, fastest wheels in off-road. Method dominates the off-road racing market, and they have wheels for your truck, Sprinter, SUV, Jeep, or van. Troy Lee Designs, built for the world's fastest racers. Troy Lee Designs blends elite level protection with a history of industry-leading style and performance. From motocross gear to custom paint to bicycle protection, Troy Lee Designs is waiting for you on the next level. This week on the Whiskey Throttle Show, Danny Laporte might be the most versatile motorcycle rider ever. A 500cc national champion, 250 world champion, ISDE gold medal winner, three-time Baja 1000 winner, Pharoah's rally winner. Laporte has done it all. He's also one of the most respected and well-liked people in our industry. We spent some time going through the life of this legend. And now, here is the host of the Whiskey Throttle Show, David Pingree.
Well, it's April 2021. Welcome to the Whiskey Throttle Show. I'm your host, David Pingree. An amazing guest today with us. We have got former 500 national champion, 250 world champion, three-time Baja winner, and basically all-around motocross legend, Danny Laporte here. Danny, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Dave.
Very excited to have you on. And we've got an awesome co-host as well. You may recognize this guy. It's the Golden Boy, Mr. Brock Glover. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for inviting me. And when you mentioned that Danny was going to be the guest, it was I couldn't jump at the opportunity fast enough.
Well, and you seem like the perfect guy. You guys are really good friends. You race together. You both went to GPs. Like, you have a lot of things, a lot of similarities in your careers. And so that's what I've been trying to get, is guys that have a good relationship to kind of stimulate conversation, right? So I appreciate you doing it. And Danny, I've been wanting to get you on for a long time. You're a very underrated guy. Like, I've known you a long time, and I know your accomplishments, but when I start digging into the facts of your career, you know, and this happens with a lot of guys, I'm like, wow, he was really badass. You know, this guy did a lot. And there were some different things about your career that stuck out to me. But largely how you just never wanted it. Once you'd accomplished something, you moved on. You weren't interested in like defending a title, or, you know, trying to back something up, run a number one plate. There was nothing in that for you. You wanted to go accomplish something else. And I find that really fascinating. I don't think a lot of people are wired that way.
Yeah, I think I just don't have concentration, I guess.
Too much ADD?
Maybe I'm too ADD, yeah.
You weren't diagnosable back then?
Actually was.
Oh, okay.
I had to take drugs when I was a kid.
True. The early Adderall boy.
Yeah. Dexedrine. It was Dexies at the time.
Is that right?
Yeah.
All right. Well, there you go. My question. We can wrap this up. We start off with a segment called the Method Race Wheels Front End Chatter. Just a couple of kind of generalized questions that I think both of you can pitch in on. Method Race Wheels bringing you this segment, the lightest, strongest, fastest wheels in off-road. Check those guys out if you need wheels for your truck, van, Sprinter, SUV, UTV. They've got them. You get 20% off using our code WhiskeyThrottle. I want to just pick both your brains about the challenges of going from U.S. racing, Supercross and Motocross, to GPs. It doesn't happen a lot going this way. You know, we get a lot of riders from the GPs that want to come here because they want to race Supercross or whatever. But, I think I could probably count on my fingers the number of guys, U.S. guys, that have gone over there and done well. Bobby Moore, you know, Mike Browns, the
Donnie Schmitz,
Trampas
Parker.
There's not a ton of them.
Nope.
What's that transition like? Because I feel like maybe we don't give enough credit to those guys that come here. It's not, I mean, it is a crazy life change, right?
Yeah, I think it's, on the other hand, though, it's exciting. I think the way I looked at it, it's in, like a new motivation. So after 4 or 5 years, 5, 6 years racing the U.S. Nationals and Supercross Series, it's kind of, you know, I was, that's why I kind of, one of the reasons I always had the idea to try to be able to win a title, a world title. But I knew I had to do something in America first, you know, so to prove myself. But so I always had that in my mind. You know, when you grow up, you watch all your heroes. They come from all over the world. You know, they probably guys like Joel Robert and Roger DeCoster, Torsten Hallman. Those are the kind of guys that stuck out in my Heikki Mikkola as well, probably. Yeah. But you know, so I think it's still at that time, no one had really gone to Europe except Brad Lackey. Brad was the only guy, and I've been following him, watch how he's every year getting better, closer to winning a title. So I just thought, wow, I think it's a good move for me at this time.
Yeah. And what was the toughest thing about that transition? Or did you, you seem like you kind of liked that culture and you probably went over there and blended right in, but yeah, was there something that was tough that stood out?
I had no idea really. I was kind of, I went to Belgium. I went early a few months before one of the first races that I had, international race. And I had to rent a house and get a car. So, it was interesting. It was all new to me. I had no idea what the racing was going to be like. And so right away, you get thrown. I started racing probably in January, and it was, you know, ice, snow, rain, Belgium, cold, freezing. Being from Southern California, going to a track that's frozen, you know. So it was really kind of tough to... That was the hard part, trying to stay warm, really. I mean, I was always in the truck, you know, had the Mercedes bus with the, you know, the heater going wide open.
Yeah.
Trying to simulate being in California. But I think that, you know, the fun part, the transition wasn't hard. It was really fun. The food was, I love different food, so I had no problem there. I always loved the food. That's not a problem. I didn't have to have the McDonald's and...
Yeah.
So it was just, I think it was the fun parts, you know, all the different things around it, you know. So the unknown to me was actually just the racing part.
But even that, you know, at least for me, when I went to Europe, because I did a couple of those Masters of Motocross international races, and the bike's different, no one's speaking your language, the way they do time qualifying, everything's different. And it threw me out of my rhythm, you know. I felt out of sorts.
I think for me, that was good because I needed to really focus to do well when I was racing. So I was, like I said, a little, you know, hyper. So I never could really concentrate really, really well. But this forced me to, I think, you know, because I had to. In Europe, you don't have a secretary taking care of your travel arrangements. And with my contract, they pay you, here's the extra money to pay for your flights, your organization, everything. You take care of it yourself. You show up at the race. You do, and that's it.
Wow.
You don't have...
No one's holding your hand.
No one's holding your hand. So right away, it's all, okay, that's kind of a good thing, you know, I think for me. So right away, I had to get a map of Europe in my house. I didn't know where I was going. So I'd have all these, you know, I knew all the GPs I had to go to. And so I just started studying everything where I was going, try to look at photos of tracks. And so I think that was a good thing for me.
Okay. You probably had a stack of passports too, because back then, right, every country you went to.
Well, no, you just one passport. But
okay, you had to get.
You didn't have visa. You didn't need a visa at the time. So the only countries you needed visas were for Bulgaria, the Eastern countries, Russia, and that was, you know, that's where I had somebody helping me out doing that. That was a little bit complicated. You know, that's a little hard. So I had a. Secretary, I guess.
Did you have a manager?
Yeah, Sonia Vantome. She worked for Roger DeCoster.
Yeah, she was a well-known manager over
there.
Okay. Things were different. They set up your international races during the week. If it was an off week in a Grand Prix, you would get appearance money.
Right.
And they would help you arrange those kind of travel.
Huh. Well, what about you, Brock? Because you went over and did 2 seasons there?
I did one season. Okay. And really, I was on my way personally ready to retire, but I got talked into going over there and helping KTM develop a bike that they wanted to market in the U.S. But obviously, we can do that at another Brock Glover interview, well, but I was going to talk about Danny.
We're going to have a Brock Glover show down the road.
Someday down the road. But like you mentioned, Danny, I mean, traveling between country to country, and it was different. You didn't have the luxury of the internet. You didn't have the luxury of smartphones and computers.
Yeah, you needed a real map.
Yeah, you needed a real, honestly, we all had map books of each of the country. And but your manager would arrange, part of it was that they would arrange international races, too, that you could fit in your schedule. So if you had a decent manager, they kind of knew your schedule, the Grand Prix schedule, and they arranged some of the international races, because international races were actually where you made your money. You made more money doing that.
Probably did maybe 20 international events on top of the 12 GPs. So, and sometimes you actually race twice a week in Europe. They had a weekend called, well, it was two different places, Leuven and Marche in Belgium. And so you'd race one, like a, I think it was a maybe Wednesday or then Saturday, some strange hours, you know.
A Wednesday afternoon, though. But we grew up racing in Southern California where you would do some night races and you'd show up after school. You'd go, okay, get in the car. Your mom would drive you and you go, okay, I'm going to do a night race here. But it was a little bit like that. I mean, I remember doing international races, literally, that practice didn't start until 1 or 2 in the afternoon. You did it and you showed up, and after practice, 20, 30 minutes later, the first moto would start on the hour, and the next hour, the next moto would start. And at the end of it all, you walked over and they stood in line and they handed you an envelope and that was your appearance money, and you're like, wow, I just made some pretty good good chunk
of
change.
You know what's really funny is the first international, a year before I went to do an international race, Roger DaCosta, he was still racing, 79, a couple of years before I went to Europe 3, and Roger goes, yeah, I got an extra bike, come on over, you know, do an international race, couple. And so I showed up there in Belgium, and Roger had a bike in his garage, where actually his mechanic, he had a really cool workshop. He had every machine in it, you know, lathes, mills. It was really Sano workshop outside of his house. And so it was the morning of the race, and Roger's, is maybe like 8 o'clock in the morning. We're still at his house. He's having some toast and some butter and some drink coffee. He's reading the paper. And I'm like, hey, I'm jonesing to go race, you know. Shouldn't we be at the race right now? He goes, no problem. It doesn't start till... practice and start until 1, you know? So, so just hang out, and I'm all nervous. And that was really funny. So I think we showed up. We didn't leave his house till 10:30 or something. Show up at the race at 11:30, because everything's, you know, in Belgium, you can go to France, you can go to Holland, you can go to Germany in an hour and a half. Yeah. So it was in Belgium this weekend. And I think the practice was at 1. You pretty much came in, get everything ready, and then the first moto is like 2, and the second one's at 4, and you're done. So you don't even show up at the race till 1, 12
That's
o'clock.
So
it's
weird.
How it should be now. It shouldn't be the 18-hour days we do it, seriously.
I know. It's really funny. Yeah. You drive in, all the spec, everyone's there waiting for you. You know, just show up, put your gear on, go do some practice, and then do the 2 motos and go home.
So they'd have a pretty big crowd for these events, too?
Oh, yeah. They're probably, you know, small. It was a medium-sized race, probably 15, 20,000 spectators at an international race. Yeah. So, no, they're pretty big. And then even more than that,
France or something like that, a big international race.
Tons of people.
Belgium was kind of the epicenter of the European motocross. I mean, even if you were from another country, you would base out of Belgium, is where I based out of also, even though KTM is obviously in Austria, but it was, and most everybody lived in Belgium.
Why is it that they can run it so efficiently and short, and we do take so long? Did they just have one practice, or do they do multiple?
Too much track time.
You can do a couple practices, and you do one 10-minute, 10 or 15,
too.
You know, one 10-minute or 10 laps. Mm-hmm. Practice and a half hour, 10 lap practice. You can do it all in an hour and a half. It's just all pro guys there. And then they have a national class as well. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, so, but it's, you don't have, you know, 25 starts or 20. It's not a local race, but it's really, it can be done short. I think it can be condensed.
Are they specified? Like, is it this one's a 500 race, this one's a 250 race, or is it kind of run what you brung, or how did it work?
No, they have either a 250 or 500 class. Mostly, at that time, there were a lot of 500. It seems like there were a lot of 500 cc Yeah. Mostly 500cc international races was the main thing.
Because 500cc was always kind of known as the king's class, premier, so that's where Rogers and the guys would, you know, so they tended to be, the international races were mostly 500cc bikes, but a lot of guys would jump up to the big bike if they were 250 riders, and they could still ride the 500s in international.
Let me ask you this. When we started winning, and you were there for that, we'll get into that 81 Motocross Donations team, but that was really a shifting of the tides where America started kicking some ass. It was pretty cool to look back at the history books and see that, and you were there at the front line. What was the relationship like with those European riders when that happened? Because somebody said, I read somewhere in prepping for this, when you won your championship, like the European riders were there all celebrating with you, and they were happy. Or no, this was after the Motocross of Nations that first year. They were actually happy for us, and I thought, oh, I wouldn't have expected that.
Yeah.
Was there a vibe of like, who are these American guys? Who do they think they are? Or were they like, yeah, that's cool?
No, they were all, I have to say that I never ran into any problem when I raced in Europe with, you know, an anti-American type thing, you know, or anything like that, because we were, you know, coming over there and starting to race in their territory. I know, they were all really cool, really helpful the whole time. I never had issue with anybody. You know, all races are a little competitive. So, you know, whether it be in America or there, we always have an edge to, you know, everyone's got a little edge. Yeah. And so that's not a problem. I mean, it's just part of the deal, you know?
Yeah.
And you notice that right away. The guys had a little more, you know, a little more chip on their shoulder than another guy, right? You could tell that. But, you know, they're just racers, so they're all the same.
Well, did you find, it was different for you. You were at the end of your career. You'd already done so much here. You probably had people just lining up for autographs.
Yeah, they're loyal to their countrymen. There's no question about it. And Danny and I both had the privilege. I rode for the Motocross Nations team in '83. And Danny, what they accomplished was unbelievable, because really at that time, the American factories weren't really interested in spending too much money to going over there. And when Honda opted, well, listen, we really think we should still participate in this. America had taken a hiatus off of sending teams for a few years. And so in '81, when Danny and the Honda team went over, it was all Honda riders. And really, it was kind of, I mean, it wasn't really the A team, I think. And they really, like, you were kind of, look, Danny was over there. So it's like, okay, well, Danny's the first, you know, he's only 1 year going.
Yeah, I think it was probably the oldest guy on the team.
Yeah, and he was only a year he rode for Honda, actually. Yeah. So he was available to ride on the team because it was going to be a Honda team. And Chuck's son had won the 500 National Championship in 1980. So he was somewhat accomplished. But that year in 81, I had dethroned him. So I was like, oh, well, why, you know, Glover should go because he's the 500 champion. Well, no, you know, so Chuck went over there. And then we had Johnny O'Mara and Donnie Hansen. And these riders had not won championships.
They were young.
Yeah, and they were young.
Oh, you guys were.
They were, you know, the squirrely young Americans, right? But Donnie's actually older than I am, but he hadn't been racing that long, so he hadn't maybe had quite as much notoriety over in Europe yet. So they weren't expected to do anything. And then the first race was actually the Motocross of Nations. Back in this era that people forget, there was actually a Motocross of Nations and a Trophy to Nations, and 500cc is the first weekend, and the second weekend was the 250 race.
No, the first was 250.
Yeah, you guys, they switched it back and forth, because the year I went, the first year was 500s, and then the next one was 250. So these guys won on 250s at Lommel in Belgium.
At Lommel. That's
I got a good story. I think I kind of, you know, makes, you know, before when the Americans, we all went to the Nations. Everybody was kind of an individual. No one was really a team. So they had a Yamaha guy, a guy from Howerton went on. He was a Husqvarna guy at the time.
And then if Lackey was over there. Lackey Brad
was
there. Race on the team.
So everybody was kind of fragmented. And everyone kind of did their own thing. The guy over there. So it was really, we never really went as a team.
As a unit.
As a unit. And to be able to win, you need to kind of be have a little bit of knowledge, you know, about what's going on. And I think having as a Honda team really prove that, you know, one complete team, all the same riders. A little quick story. The week before the race, Roger goes, you know, someone's got to do a couple, at least one 45-minute motos. We need to see if our bikes will even finish the race.
Didn't even know if the bike could make 45 minutes on the gas tank. Yeah.
So O'Mara and I think I did. I think it was Johnny or maybe Donnie, one of the guys who were. So we went out and did 45. Sure enough, we ran out of gas.
Where'd you do that?
On a sand track. It was a practice track, Zolder.
Okay.
And it was just, well, they're all flat in Belgium, all the sand tracks.
But Zolder also had Sandy. They had the Motocross of Nations there.
Later on
when Carmichael had the big battle with Stefan Everts there. It was at Zolder.
And this was just, at the time, just like a practice track, I think. They might have had some local events. Mm-hmm. So he goes, you know, yeah, someone's got to do it. So we did it. Ran out of gas, sure enough, on the 250 tanks were small. You know, so we had to go to the 500 tank, and yeah, that's just a little example. We would all run out of gas probably in Blummel for sure, because you are literally pinned the whole time on a 250.
Heavy sand, bottomless sand.
Even now, you see little 250 four strokes out there. They're just wide, full to the stop, twisted the whole time, and they look like they're not even going anywhere. It's because the bumps are literally, you know. The arch of a bump in Lummels can be 10, 15 foot long.
The joke over there was like they were buried Volkswagens. And yeah, so that's where like a Volkswagen bug. They were
buried. It's like one year, it's exhausting.
But one thing that you brought up, you know, Roger DeCoster. I mean, Roger was the team manager, but everybody knows Roger DeCoster at this point. But you have to realize Roger in 1981. Had just come off of retiring. He rode in Honda the year before in the GP. So he was 1 year removed from racing full-time
and
GP.
And he won his last GP,
last GP just, you know, a year earlier. He won his last GP, and now all of a sudden he's a team manager. He's got all these young, squirrely kids over here. He can trust Danny because he knows Danny. You know, Danny's like, okay, Danny's the – okay, he's the mature one here, and we got this handle. Let's see Danny come up, be the team leader. And I think one point back then, because they had four rider teams and, you know, to try to put everybody on the gate and in some of the qualifiers, did you not have to ride from the second row or something? Do you remember? I remember you having to start maybe in the second row.
Maybe in the second. I think so.
Qualifying race or something? Yeah.
Yeah. Because we didn't even exist, so we had to start. Yeah, exactly.
In a qualifying race. They weren't seated because they hadn't done
it. Yeah, we had to seed ourselves first to qualify to get in. Yeah.
So you were digging out of a hole right away.
Yeah. Exactly. I just remember that fantastic. I mean, like, they were all JT riders, and Danny and I have been JT guys, so we've had this friendship from, you know, I mean, I mentioned earlier before we started the show, it's like Danny's in my relationship to me. I have so many memories that have nothing to do with racing motorcycles or on the track. And maybe they had that commonality, why we were there at the event or whatever. But Danny and I, we've just known each other for so long. But we have so many, to this day, even more, you know, friendships off the track and activities
that's off
the track. But it's just terrific that, you know, he was able to go over there and to do that and to be.
How old were you? If you were the oldest guy on the team, how old were you?
Yeah, let me see. What year?
81.
So 20... Six.
Okay.
25.
25, yeah.
25.
December birthday. It's hard to do the
math. Yeah, 25.
yeah, 25. Yeah. So he's the old man at 25.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Wow. Yeah, because I raced 6 years in the U.S. before I went to, that was my last year. So
I know we should, I mean, I'm interested in knowing, I know you started at a pretty young age. And it was, you know, I think I started riding in 69 on a little tiny Z50 or something. But I think you were racing by that point. Growing up in Southern California, and when I first met, like, who knew who Danny Laporte was, I think you were probably already on your Metco Pentons by then, but that would have been in 72 probably or so. But tell me, I'm interested in hearing about, I know you had a family that rode, your dad rode, and you even had a sister that had a motocross bike, right?
Yeah, she had a Hodaka Super Rat.
Your sister did?
Yeah. We both started on, you know, whatever we had kind of laying around, you know, we could find. It was not, you know, I mean, at the time, it was really, there weren't really 80cc mini bikes. So I could barely stand on a, you know, on a full-size motorcycle. And the Hodakas were pretty tall, actually.
Yeah. It kind of was, they either had little homemade pit bikes with a
pull starter,
lawnmower start, or it was a full-size motor. There wasn't really anything.
No, there wasn't. That was it.
And then when the steam came around and bikes like that came around, they were kind of a VanTech, I think, made a frame, a local Southern California gentleman. I think he's even the AMA Hall of Fame, Mr. VanTech. But they made a bike that was sort of a midsize that stuck Hodaka motors in them, those chassis. Yeah. And then they made the bike.
Yeah, the VanTech.
Yeah, like VanTech and a Steens. I remember the bikes were.
Somebody in the neighborhood had one.
Yeah. So they were
rich.
Yeah, they were super rich. They probably had $500 or $600 for that bike, but so you went right. Did you start right on a Hodaka or something,
the very first race was on a Hodaka at Gaffey Street in L.A. down by the slough. We called it the slough. It was like an unofficial race.
Yeah. Brackish Water Lagoon down there.
Yeah, right. Five Corners. Anaheim Street and Gaffey Street all came
on
right there.
On the asphalt?
No, it was on the dirt. It was just a field with, you know, they used to, like a dump. All the neighborhood people would throw their concrete off the sides of the
It's where all motocross tracks start in L.A. But, so your dad, though, like you didn't just wake up one day and go, I'm going to go riding out in the field out by Torrance, and all of a sudden I'm going right to the starting line.
You had to
have had a little filler there.
My dad pulled up. This is when I was totally done. When he pulled up, in the back of his truck, he had a Montesa. In the back, it was a Montesa lacrosse, and I looked at that thing. You know, it was, at that time, I can't remember the names of all the bikes, but they Bull Taco had cool name, and then you had Persang, and there was a Libido,
Sherpa,
all these really cool names. And I think I'm missing El Bandito was big 360.
Yeah,
but it was a Montesa lacrosse. It was a different than a Bull Taco, but anyway, it was a Spanish bike.
Yeah.
And I looked at that as a kid and just go, wow, that's just, is that thing, you know? So, and then the next time we went riding out in the desert, and we had, I had a little mini bike, you know, Bonanza with a pull string.
There you go.
Yeah. So we went up to Holiday Hills.
What'd you mow your lawn with? Because you took the motor out of your lawnmower and put it in your mini bike.
Probably. Yeah,
exactly.
So we go to the local mountains. We go trail riding. You know, it's kind of where I started in Palmdale, Lancaster area.
Okay.
Holiday Hills. I think a lot of people know that. It's SoCal, if anyone's listening from SoCal. Mm-hmm. And, it's a really, really great area because you had a little bit of everything. And I remember my dad taking off and him and his buddies, they go on a, you know, loop, big loop, whatever. And I'd get on my mini bike and try to follow him, you know, and then, you know, that was kind of how I started. I started crying because I couldn't catch up.
Chasing your dad.
I was probably nine years old at the time.
Yeah. What did you do in the interim before you got that first bike? Were you into other sports or?
Yeah.
You grew up in just South Bay, right?
Yeah, in the South Bay. And my dad was, you know, he was really loved sports. I mean, he was a sport, you know, he was just really athletic himself. Great gym. He was a gymnast when he was young. So he was... You know, he did a lot of exciting things in his life, and I think that's kind of, you know, a little bit like, I think Travis Pastrana's father was in the Marines, but my dad was a Ranger, and, you know, everything he did, he was always skydiving, you know, for on weekends, doing stuff like that, diving, and so I think it kind of is in his blood.
Yeah.
And he passed that along.
So we had a really interesting conversation with Steve Caballero last week about whether or not that is something that you inherited in your genetics, or like, do you think it was just from hanging around your dad? And that's the way he was. He was full throttle and dirt bikes and skydiving. And so you just sort of gravitated to that?
Yeah, he was definitely crazier than I was. The idea for me going racing a bike, I was a little, I don't know if I really want to race. I wasn't really sold on it at first. At first I'm thinking, nah, that doesn't sound right. You know, the racing part really didn't, I liked riding, but I wasn't into racing. And then he convinced me to try it, to give it a shot.
Did he race also?
Yeah, he was racing. Okay, you know, events. You know, there were scrambles. There were different kinds of, you know, events going on. But he did enduro. He rode enduros, local events like that off road. But there weren't really a lot of motocrosses in '67, '68 at that time. But so he just convinced me to give it a shot, and I think that's when I got sold on it.
Yeah.
After I got, just I needed to take, somebody needed to push me a little bit.
It's funny to think that, you know, Danny says, my dad was crazier than I am. I was like, that's a foreign thought to me, actually, because it's like, I always just imagine that the kids always get crazier than the parents, you know, through the generations. But the fact that your dad was jumping out of airplanes and doing all this, riding dirt bikes back in the late 60s. And you mentioned the fact there really wasn't a whole lot of motocross. That was right about when I saw my very first motocross race. And I was very fortunate in the fact that Edison Dye, the man who's credited with bringing the sport to the United States and being the Husqvarna importer and with a company called Viking Imports, that he was based out of the San Diego area, and then he had set up the Husqvarna, and the Torsten Hallman would come over. So that's really when, about that time is when you start seeing the Husqvarna motorcycles and the Montesas, as you mentioned your father had. And, yeah. and you actually saw a purpose-built motocross bike. It's no longer the bike that used to be some street bike-y sort of a bike stripped down and put knobby yeah. tires on it. Now you actually saw real motocross bikes, and you got exposed to these Europeans that were coming over early on. And now the sport was in America.
At that time, actually, there was motocross racing going on, but I don't think we really knew about it. You know, we mm-hmm. were kind of, you really had to kind of look for it. And a lot of local guys that when I grew up, a guy named Jim Wilson, great ride. Mm-hmm. He was a super talented guy. Yeah. He was actually, we were all family friends and the local guys, the Kulaks. And I think the Kulak, so they all rode dirt bikes. We all live within a mile of each other. So we started to find that what's going on, the Kulaks, they were into desert racing. Wilson was a motocross guy, you know. Actually, he rode trials in motocross.
He's a fantastic motocross guy. Yeah. He raced a lot of European guys. He gave him fits at Saddleback.
And he dominated local on Greaves. He was a super talented guy. Amazing, you know. Mm. Kind of like, you know, he could, because he had the trials background. So I think, you know, and we learned a lot from him, you know, getting into the motocross world. And so kind of, and then we had a local guy, Tim Hart, which was obviously, he was a great local guy, rode the Nationals. And
he was a Yamaha rider.
So, you know, we really didn't know all this that was going on right in our backyard, really, you know.
Yeah.
So
it was very niche at first. And you said, it was pockets you had to search out. And,
yeah.
And to your point about the bikes, I remember Marty Smith when he was on here telling us about the first time he got knobby tires. Yeah. Because what he was riding was just a street bike, and they would just modify it and race it in the dirt, you know, put a pie plate number.
Yeah, I think Marty started on, like, what was an AT1? It was Yamaha.
Yeah,
and then I know Marty's history well, and then he put a knobby tires on it. It was no longer.
And he was so pumped to have knobbies.
Yeah, absolutely. It's no longer an enduro. But you mentioned Jim Wilson, and I got one day we were at Anaheim Stadium, and I knew Jim and how good he was and how kind of an underrated he was, but he was an excellent, like, he ran hard, like, at the big international races at Saddleback and those races, and he did very well. And he was a big tall guy, real tall.
Yeah,
I was kind of like, oh my gosh, I really want to meet him. And he was at the Legends and Heroes event over there. And honestly, it was like one of my, I still remember it at Anaheim Stadium afterwards, getting in the motorhome of Alex Moros and Carol Moros after the race and having a glass of wine, sitting there listening to Jim. And I asked him 1,000 questions because I knew kind of a lot of his history of racing Saddleback, reading the cycle news and things. And he was such a great guy. He was a wonderful guy.
So, yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah, he is. Yeah. Really is. Yeah.
We were actually talking about this earlier. These guys who were so good back then, Bruce McDougall is the guy we were talking about, mm-hmm. but who just never really, either they were before their time when racing was really, being a pro racer was a thing, or mm-hmm. they just didn't make that step out of local racing. But there's some incredibly talented guys that were here. Mm-hmm. It just,
well, at that time too, you know, there really wasn't a big future in motocross.
Right.
I don't think so. People were thinking, you know, they had to go to get a real job. You know, it's kind of like myself. I was in the garage. I had been racing local events. I started off with, we'll talk about that maybe a little bit more, but I started doing, I was doing all the local CMC races and with Kelvin Frakes at the time. And I got a phone call from Suzuki, and it was Tosh Koyama, and he's
Koyama. Yeah.
Yeah. And, he says, would you be interested in racing the Nationals for us? And I said, can I call you back? So I hung up on the phone, got his number, went to my parents. I said, what do you think if I started racing the Nationals with Suzuki? And my dad said, oh, you got to go for it. You know, you only have one opportunity. You might as well do it. Because at that point, I was really thinking either going to school, working for my dad. He had electrical contracting business, you know, or moving out. You were talking about that before. So there really wasn't. You know, you didn't really look going into a sport thinking that you could actually make a living from it. You know?
Yeah. Was there anybody? I mean, was there somebody you looked up to, like, that was actually doing it?
Not really. No, Jim Wilson was the only local guy, and then he was still out there racing at that time I think he had hurt himself. He had a spectator running across the track at Carlsbad, mm-hmm. and blew his knee up.
Oh, man.
I may be wrong, but I think that's what happened. And So there really wasn't anybody locally that I knew that was really making a living at it. But it was so, you know, it just wasn't something you'd think about taking a chance and spending the next 10 years of your life, you know, doing.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah,
the factory rider was, but, you know, it was a little bit in its infancy where the you know, Honda had started their team in late 73 with some local guys, but most of them were just R&D racers, you know, the Bruce Barons and the guys like this. And then they did get that team in 74 when the National 125 Nationals became a championship. And then Marty Smith was kind of the first real American Idol, teen Idol racer that became. And yeah. It's like, okay, wait, I think he's making a living at this. You know, he's making a good living at this. And so Danny was kind of like a half a generation behind that. So When Suzuki approached you at that time, you were already kicking ass at local. I mean, well, he talked about Kelvin Franks. Kelvin Franks was the partner of Stu Peters and CMC. Kelvin was more a fabricator in his mind, and he built like special one-off bikes and put different engines in them. And he had a lot of good riders. He would handpick kind of like the premier guy to ride. And then you rode for that powerhouse Metco Penton team just before that as kind of a peripheral rider. They had the Bruce McDougals you mentioned. They had Charlie Bauer, Chuck Bauer, who ended up, those two guys got factory rides alongside of Marty Smith as a teammate. Mm. And then Danny was just a little younger coming along at that area. But then when Kelvin Franks started helping you with his bikes. I think you rode those bikes just after Tommy Croft did. And then that's when I signed up my first Carlsbad as a CMC pro. And I show up there, and Marty Smith, national champion, Tommy Croft, his right-hand man, teammate, killer assassin, Carlsbad expert, and Danny Laporte. And I'm like, oh, man. Like,
what have I done?
What did I do? Like, I was so, oh, man.
Well, I was trying to get to where Marty Smith was still, too. You know, and you were trying to get. So
I was trying to get where Danny Laporte used to be, like, 6 months ago.
But, you know, it was really. So I was a moment. I had probably 6 months or a year where I almost stopped completely riding. Yeah. And what made me get back on a motorcycle was I went up to Snake River. I borrowed Jim Wilson's van. He loaned me his van. And I have to thank him for that. Thanks, Jim. And so I drive up to Ida to watch this race. You know, when
this was Evel Knievel Snake River.
Yeah, which was they did that 2 years in a row, and the second one was the year he tried to jump the Snake River Canyon.
Right.
So did you go to the first one?
Yeah, because I wanted to watch Knievel try to jump the.
Yeah,
the
snake. I was there when he jumped. When he attempted to jump, I was actually.
Oh, you were there too?
I rode the amateur day, but they had the big pro race the next day. But I rode the amateur race, got third. Third and won a Harley Davidson, what they called the dual sport ride.
About that. Yeah. So I was. Yeah. I didn't know you were there. Yeah. So I go up there with my girlfriend at the time, and
you're 16, 17, yeah. Maybe 16, 17. 16. Yeah, 17. You drive from Southern California with his girlfriend in Jim Wilson's borrowed van. No problem.
Different times.
You're a parent.
Jim was with me or not. I don't know.
We're all parents. We're thinking back going, there's not a prayer we would let our kids do that to this day.
No, I know. So, it was pretty fun. Anyway, Marty wins the race. Yeah. And I think he made at the time, was it nearly 9,000 or something?
I think
like
it was 9 or 10,000 for first place. It was the largest purse they'd ever had in a motor.
$100,000 purse or something, right?
Yeah, it was
total.
Crazy. Yep.
And it got fire under my rear, and we went back to Los Angeles. I bought a Honda Elsinore.
Yeah.
With my own money.
About that? The money or just like seeing Marty?
No, because I knew where Marty, you know, because we kind of hit a little bit. I was riding at Indian Dunes and Saddleback and local events up north. Marty was more down south guy. So, but I'd run into Marty in the years, and I go, well, if he can do it, I think I can do it too, you know? So it was that simple.
He was coming off of the Monarch, and then he got the Honda ride.
Yeah.
And it was like,
and he really kind of motivated me to get back into it again. Mm. So I was clearly kind of going away from the sport, and I saw him win the money. I go, wow, okay. There could be something here.
Take me more than a year of working hard in construction to make $9,000.
So it cost me, I bought a Honda 125, I think $600 or whatever, 125.
Yeah, you got a deal because I think MSRP was like $649 or something. They were literally, you could buy a brand new Elsinore, $700 for sure, you're driving out the door, and you could go race, you could be racing pro race, but, you know, with $1,000 worth of motorcycle.
That's crazy.
It was fun.
Yeah. I can't remember.
Did you get paid from that race? I heard Evil had, there was some shady business, like some of the people didn't get paid. The checks didn't, checks
oh,
bounced.
You mean the Evel Knievel thing? No, I didn't race.
Oh,
I
you didn't race. You
just to watch. I thought it'd be a great trip. Go watch him jump. Yeah. You go see what's going on. And so that, yeah. So, okay. Yeah.
They had it was a fun deal. It was like a big festival to all the Harley guys. There was a big, maybe some biker groups possibly, and maybe broke into the big beer trucks and maybe distributed some alcohol.
Oh, is that
yeah,
right?
Oh, yeah. I think that was just like, okay, don't tear up my truck. I'll open the door for you guys because they're gonna tear the semis up. They literally opened the door and just said, take the contents, don't destroy my truck.
Wow.
Yeah, I remember sleeping in a cot outside, and I already raced that day, and the pro race was the next day, and man, like, it was like Woodstock going on, and I'm like, I'm 13 years old.
Yeah, you were like 13.
I was 13 years old, and I shouldn't be here or something. I was not with my parents. I actually went up with Radical Ron Turner, and we borrowed his parents' Class C motorhome, and then we all drove up there together, and Ron won the amateur day, the expert class, and I signed up as an expert, not thinking I had a chance for a top 20, and I got third behind another San Diegan, got John Tessitore. The San Diego Tessitore. Guys just won 1, 2, 3, and we all won these Harley motorcycles. We got the Harleys, and then, as you said, there was some, supposedly Marty Tripes, I think, won the most money that day. He rode like 2 or 3 classes, and Brad Lackey actually rode a 125 Husky that day, too. You know, all these guys rode like all 3 classes, and Rex State, all of them just said, hey, there's too much money out here. If I could even,
I want to say, was Gary Jones there? Maybe it was him that told me that he got word away, hey, go cash these checks right now.
They were there when the bank opened up in Twin Falls or wherever they had the money. They were there supposedly when the doors opened up to get their checks cashed because they were worried about the
Tripes. If you ever bump into Tripes, he has the parking pass from that event. He has the original flyer. He has the payout. Like he kept all the paperwork pristine. It's in a scrapbook.
There's a couple guys around Boise that still have that too, and Billy Ull, who is UHL, that family was phenomenal ISDE riders that lived in the Boise area, and a lot of those I actually saw the original artwork of the original hand drawn of the first year. A guy had the artwork.
Oh, wow.
It was fantastic. Yeah,
that's collector's item stuff.
That jump is still there. The actual
ramp is still there.
The ramp is still there. And they've actually used to be you couldn't really get out to it. Now there's actually a trail up to it. You can go visit it because I see it. And Danny and I have this long tie also with the Sun Valley, Ketchum, Idaho area. We still have my wife.
You go down, you see it all the time.
Yeah. I pass it by every time I look over to Costco. To Costco's on the right and the jump's on the left.
Really?
It's still
right there. You know what
really
is funny is that, you know, in the Rocket he had a lever. Mm-hmm. For the chute, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the chute really went off right when he left.
It never moved. The
chute
rocket
came
took
out.
Off.
It stopped him, and he drifted back into the...
Yeah, he would have made it for sure if that
chute... He would
have,
and I think it's just the G-force probably, his arm, and it went back and he pulled it, you know.
My understanding was
it should have been a lever you push forward, right?
My understanding was is that the lever was spring-loaded. Like, you had to hold it forward, and if you, like, blacked out, anything happened to you...
It would automatically go off.
And so the G-forces were so high. If you watch the footage, the chute really never moves. The rocket takes off. It was on, like, a rail, almost like a single-track monorail. And it went up. They called it the sky cycle, remember? And it got to the end of it, and then when the cords or the parachute cords... They got to the very end of it, and then it reaches, you know, the full length of the cord, and then you see the chute start. The rocket carries the chute all the way over to the north end,
and then back.
Then the wind drifts back, and it lands partway in the water. And I remember, I think, like, I sat on the edge of that canyon. I'm sure you did, too.
Yeah,
there was 5,000-10,000 people
running to the side.
Yeah, we're standing on the edge of a canyon, like, oh my, like, I wouldn't even walk to that edge today, but at the time we stood there, we were not going to miss a beat of that thing. We were going to watch it all. And to this day, it's very funny. I run into Travis Pastrana and stuff. They base jump off of the bridge that goes across there.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. Travis goes up there a couple times a year, he says, and I watch guys base jump, do backflips, crazy people, man.
Nothing surprises me with Travis.
No, not at all.
Yeah. So what riders did you look up to once you kind of, when you made that kind of decision to go back to racing? Was there a guy you were like, I want to be like this guy, I need to do it this way? Was it Marty?
Well, probably it was probably Marty because he's the, you know, he'd be in my category class, and I knew if I was going to race, it'd be at 125. So
I guess let me ask this too. Sorry to cut you off. Were you looking at Europe at that time? Like, did you guys?
No, not at all.
No one was going. Those are the best guys in the world.
No, not at all. No, I had no idea where I was going to go. So I, basically.
You knew where you were going. You're going to Saddleback.
Indian Dunes.
Carlsbad, Saddleback, Carlsbad, occasional Indian Dunes, Ascot night race.
Yeah, that's all I knew, really.
Exactly.
Well, first you were going back to the van with that 16-year-old girl and then getting her home eventually.
Yeah, hopefully from, right. from Twins Falls.
Everyone had vans back then. That's true.
Exactly.
So, sorry, but, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Yeah, so where was I?
No, we were talking about what your your thought process, like, you know, you saw Marty Smith and all of a sudden, okay, I want to not be like Marty Smith, but I want to, like, race like him and I want to maybe beat him.
Yeah, absolutely. I think at the time, you know, things changed so quickly. Right away, I think when I got hired by Suzuki, and because Marty won, I think 2 years in a row, unofficially. Then the second year was a big win.
Yeah, yeah.
75. It kind of the Yamaha, Suzuki, and Kawasaki. I think they go. We gotta go out there and do something. You know, they're out there. They're winning championships. We need to do the same thing. At the same time, I think when I got hired, Yamaha hired Hanna. They hired
Danny Turner.
Danny Turner, mm-hmm. And Suzuki hired myself, and Billy Grassi rode on the 125 class as well with me that year, and Jeff Jennings.
Yep,
I think Jeff was in the furry first year, so we were kind of like they wanted to put together a real 125 team. Yamaha wanted to put together 125 and go after the championship. Mm-hmm. And so the very first race of the championship was in Hangtown in 76. Mm-hmm. And that's when I think Marty finally said, okay, now we got some competition, you know.
Yeah, there was definitely, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So, and then your first national that year came in 1976, Rio Bravo 125. And the reason I know that, you know who won the first moto?
You.
I did. On a DG Honda.
Was that your first win?
My first moto win. I won the first moto. And then the next moto, we had taken our bike ran a single ring, you know, and the stock piston had two rings. We didn't run the bottom ring. We had little holes in the ring gland, and that kind of went into these little worm ports, and it made, you know, bike ran pretty good. But the piston ring broke in the second moto. I'm like, something's not right here. It doesn't have the same pull it had that first moto when I won it. So I nursed it around. I ended up third. Danny, I think, went 2-1 and won the overall. So he won his very first national overall. I won my very first moto, AMA Pro Moto, in the first moto as a privateer on a DG Honda. And then, Danny.
And then
you won the very next week, I think, the very next week, and he went back-to-back. That's Danny for you. He's Mr. Back-to-back if you look at his career. He does a lot of things in streaks.
My first race in Hangtown, I think there was the second moto.
The real Hangtown.
Plymouth
track. That was sandy.
That track was an awesome track. Beautiful, amazing track. Had a little bit of everything, but it was really a great track. And I snapped a pair of forks off at that race, the very first national.
Oh.
We don't want to bag on the brand there, but there was a little era there that we talked about that. It also happened to you in Florida. We were talking about that. Danny and I battled each other when I first signed with Yamaha. And we did the Winter Am series, and there was a crazy drop-off jump at Gainesville, the Gatorback track. And we were jumping off this thing, flat-landing from about two stories up, and both of us were like, this is not good.
But it's not going to end well.
But we were balanced. Like, if I let up, Danny's jumping it. And if Danny knew if he let up, I would jump it.
You had to do it,
But Danny's thinking, I broke a set of forks before, and Roger had a horrendous crash, I think, at Livermore, where he needed, like, his face, and he wore a full face after that forever. He had a horrendous crash. And it also, I think, Tony D had a set. Yeah. There were some triple clamps and some maybe steering. There were some issues with some of the Works magnesium parts that were occasionally breaking.
So there was a rash of work stuff.
Yeah,
breaking.
work stuff only. Yeah,
the triple clamp, the bottom clamp, was made from hollow casted magnesium.
And cast.
Cast. So, you know, cast is really brittle.
Hollow.
And it's hollow. Man. It was hollow.
Yikes.
Super lightweight. But, you know, the top clamps both were magnesium. And then after that, they went to solid billet.
Okay. Yeah, hollow cast. Like, of course you're going to break something.
Everything was about weight at the time.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, everything, I think the weight limits were really low. So everything was the lighter the bikes.
The 125, if my memory is right, and I hope somebody corrects me if I'm not, I think the 125 weight limit was like 176, and I think the 250 was like 194 or something. It was
really low.
Wow.
Crazy,
really light.
Crazy lightweight bikes. And, and it takes a lot to get a 125 down to 176 or whatever it was. And so the bikes were super light. flight, Suzuki's were always on the limit, and more so than probably any other brand. But unfortunately, there were some times where some...
Interesting, because now even a 125 to get it under 200 is a modern 125.
Yeah, yeah. It takes some work. No question. Yeah, like it's not often now that the rider weighs... You know, back in the day, there was common times where the rider weighed more than the motorcycle. I don't think that's happening today.
Maybe Benny Bloss.
I do know that right now because I ride a vintage 125 Elsinorov, and I am definitely heavier than that bike.
But you were telling me there's some footage of both you that day. Is it that day or it's practice during the week?
No, it's a full race, the 1977 Winter
Am. I just discovered it a couple months ago.
Okay, we're going to find it. We'll put it on our social channels. Yeah. But this day at Gatorback these two are talking about. So we'll get the posted.
Can you speed it up just a little bit? So
No way.
You have to remember, these are 1976. I'm on a 125 YZD, and I remember I thought it was cool because I had an aluminum profab swing arm, you know, on this old monoshock that used to go up underneath the frame. And Danny was on a hybrid kind of lots of works parts on, I think, a production-based bike.
Yeah, basically.
But, you know, we knew each other well from Southern California, but, man, we were going at it, and I think you throw a blanket over us for the whole moto. And this was the main series didn't start a little later. They didn't start first weekend in January at Anaheim, but so we had this Winter Am that we would use as training, and the teams all kind of like to go down there and, you know, whip their riders into shape.
Take me through your first year then. Once you got that Suzuki ride, that was 76 was your first year.
Mm-hmm.
You got that first win in was it Texas,
Rio Bravo,
right?
Backed it up with the next one at New Orleans,
right? Exactly.
That was the first streak he went on. And how'd the rest of that series go?
Well, that was it.
That was it.
Oh, that was in
New Orleans. Orleans had finished,
Okay.
And Danny, and like you said, he had Billy Grassi. And Billy was, there's another one of those riders that had a lot of talent. And Danny and Billy had a lot of knee issues and things like that. Yeah. But at any given time, like Danny, I'd show up at a national. I was a privateer guy driving around with my dad in a DG van or a pickup truck or whatever, a towed trailer or whatever we had. And I remember you guys were, you know, Billy would, he had a lot of speed. And then all of a sudden he wouldn't show up one way. Well, where's Billy? Oh, he's a knees ball. You know, he had a knee injury. He struggled with that. So Danny didn't really always have support all the time, but that was if you remember, that was the Hannah had the water cooled Yamaha, and then Marty Smith was trying to defend a title, but Marty was also flying back and forth between Europe and all that stuff. So it was kind of everybody trying to figure out who was going to be the kingpin that day. And then in the middle of it all, they threw the claiming rule. The claiming rule was always in effect, but then all of a sudden the claiming rule, there was privateer guys trying to claim the factory bikes. So sometimes these guys had to ride factory bikes, and sometimes they had to ride a production bike with a few modified factory parts. And I remember one race on July 4th, Bicentennial, 1976. It was July 4th in Kaisers Ridge, Maryland, and it was the Coombs family, one of their first national they promoted. And I think Yamaha just goes, there's no way we're losing this water-cooled bike. They took and put it like a last year's air-cooled engine in Bob's chassis and said, try to win on that, and he didn't win. Yeah. And they're like, oh, crud. Okay, now we need to put that water cooling back on, but we got to figure out a way this bike's not going to get claimed for $2,000 or whatever that was. It was a really low number, you know. So if you claimed a works bike for that, and it was crazy.
Yeah, the manufacturers would have a bunch of their people try to claim it. If they knew someone else was going to try to claim it, that way at least your odds, because it was just a lottery, right?
Yeah, this is right in my wheelhouse. I mean, do you remember much of the claiming?
I remember really well. But
did you either of you have a bike claimed or try to be claimed?
No.
Luckily, I was not. One bike finally did get claimed. It was a factory Honda. Marty Tripes' bike, and I remember John R. was my mechanic later, but he was the mechanic at the time, and that hurt his feelings. I mean, it's like, dang it, that guy just took something I built. You know, that's my bike. You know, what they did was they realized, okay, we got to figure out a way to kind of stack the odds in our favor. So they had to be the first time it was actually done. There was a technicality where the rules said you had to have either a cashier's check or a bank check. It was, I can't remember which it was, but the guy showed up with the opposite. He showed up with a cashier's check when it needed to be a bank check, or a bank check when it needed to be a cashier. And it was the technicality, the tiniest technicality that somebody caught. And they're like, hey, this says right here it needs to be black and white, a bank check and not a cashier's check. And that's, so they wouldn't allow the guy to take the bike. So they tried again a couple of times, but the factories got smart enough to realize that each team manager would literally come with a briefcase with a bunch of cashier's checks in it. So what they would do was, if you rode for Yamaha, factory rider, of course your name would get thrown in as, I'm counter-protesting, trying to, let's say it was Danny's bike. Okay, Brock Lover wants to buy Danny's bike. Okay, and so does my teammate and my other teammate and my other teammate. And also David Pingree is a support rider. He's trying to claim it. And here, David, here's the check.
Here's your check. Here's
and
your
so,
check.
So they have 12, 15, 20 guys going against one guy trying to claim all the same motorcycle with the gentleman's agreement that if anyone won the bike other than the guy trying to claim it, we would just obviously give it back to the factory.
Yeah.
So that's how it kind of worked for a while. Then finally, I think the manufacturers are like, enough's enough of this. This is just a game. Yeah. If you want us to be at these races and you got to get rid of this claiming rule and we're not going to play anymore.
You know, what's really funny is that they actually made quite a bit of regulations about the development to slow down the development at the time. You know, remember they had Reed case stuff. They wouldn't allow the a lot of injection wasn't I mean, there were a lot of little they really tried to hold back the development of two strokes at the time. You know, a lot of them they just tried to
just the money they were throwing at
right
them. Well, you were telling us a story about
until the four strokes arrived, then they threw all that away and said, do whatever you want.
you were talking about a story where, you know, you'd heard about a secret Honda test of a twin cylinder, and Danny knew about a twin cylinder 250, and there was a twin cylinder 125 that Honda developed, and there were secret testing going on, and you think about the money it just takes to develop the bikes like that. And it was fun times, and the fact that let's look at like the 74, 75 era when we grew up trying to, before we became factory riders or before we became pros per se, Danny turned a year earlier than I did, but we would show up every week at Carlsbad or Saddleback or whatever a big CMC race was. And honestly, it was fun to walk through the pits because somebody had figured out some new invention, like Danny talked about, like a snail pipe, you know, a pipe that went up and over, didn't even go down. Well, you can't go down because I've got my suspension under the cradle of the frame. Because everybody at the time, the stock Elsinore came with 4 inches of travel in the rear and 6 or 7 in the front. People were figuring out a way to get 9 or 10 in the front, and they were trying to get 7 or 8 in the rear, and they were coming up with all these inventions. So literally, it was a great
it
time.
Was
it
really
was so much
it was
fun.
like Kelvin's bikes. They were all one off completely.
Kelvin Frank's bikes.
Then Wheelsmith guys were doing a lot of different stuff at the time with Mako's, putting all the long travel suspension and
Wheelsmith. I remember that.
Yeah, we were trying to figure out. The Wheelsmith guys dominated the 250 and 500 classes on their Mako's a lot, and the 125s were always a Honda base engine, it seemed like. But it was fun to come to the races and just see the constant improvement of the bike. But it was no different at the factory level too. For many years, I would always wait for that first factory bike when, you know, once I signed my Yamaha contract, it was like you were like, this is like kind of the kid in the can, like waiting for Christmas, that anticipation, what that factory bike, the first time, hey, the factory bikes just showed up in, you know, in March or something, you know, and you'd go, I'd drive up to Yamaha from San Diego, a couple hours up to Orange County, I wanted to see the bike. I didn't, it was like, absolutely. Yeah.
Come out of the crate.
Yep.
New race bikes are always the best.
Yeah. Yep.
So, you had a good season in 76, so you had to be going into that next year confident. You had won a moto. Did you ever get an overall that season?
No, not 76.
Well, we're setting up for what was a really drama-filled 77 series. And there's obviously a lot of... what's the word?
There's a lot of misinformation. I mean, and that's what I look at.
Well, and you had so many guys. There were so many things about that season because you had Hannah coming in, Wardy, you.
Yeah. Hannah was a defending champion though.
And then,
there was so much competition in that class, elite level guys. I would have been a great series to watch, right? So.
I know I can tell you all about it.
And Weinert also Weinert rode too. Kawasaki would throw Weinert in there once in a while.
Exactly. He would, some of the guys in the 250 would ride a class on that. You could do that.
You could drop down.
We often went into World 250 Nationals. We tried to stay out of the way of the guys.
My part of my Yamaha contract was like I was in high school and it was like I'm going to finish high school. I got like 2 more years of high school, so I didn't. I raced the minimum. Race, I probably made pretty good living because I only raced seven or eight races a year. it was pretty good.
But you were full-time doing whatever you could.
If there was an open weekend, I'd go do a 250 or a 500. You could jump on anything.
Well, look at the guy. So, he's strong as heck. He could drive a 250 or a 500, no problem.
But the The 77 season, right.
So were you? Did you come in pretty confident, or what was your mindset going into the opener? And where was the opener? Was it Plymouth again?
It was at Hangtown.
Yeah, Hangtown, yeah. Plymouth again.
And I got the, I won, I think both, I won both motos.
Both motos, yeah.
And I started off really strong, and I think I just, in my mind, I just kind of kept trying to keep it even all the way through, which was, I felt pretty confident, pretty safe. And then, you know, the one I lost, did a little, I kind of along.
He DNF'd a moto at Keysburg.
Yeah,
Second round, right. He DNF'd
that,
a moto.
And that really narrowed the whole championship out. Of course, then it became down to the very last few races.
Yeah. Was that Suzuki good? Was that a good
bike? Oh, it was great. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. The bike was a modified factory bike. So we had forks, we had suspension, we had swing arm, we had different, you know, the factory components on the bike. But the chassis, I think, was stock. But, you know, when at that time, though.
I couldn't tell. Don't look at me, because I couldn't tell the difference between your factory bikes. I don't know.
Yeah, it was a production kind of a half breed. Yeah. And the year before, they were full factory bikes in 76, and in 77 they were semi-production bikes. And the reason is that you get used to practicing on, at the time, a stock chassis, and it's like a tool, it's like anything, you know how to, it felt better riding a stock bike than it did a factory bike, basically. So
comfortable pair of shoes.
A lot of guys, you guys did that. I think Yamaha was doing the same thing too. Sometimes they'd use stock chassis, different parts, components. And so the bike worked great.
And then you guys had some issues at that opening round, and I know you've kind of had some friction with Jody at MXA over this, like him kind of telling the story wrong.
What was that, the opening round in Hangtown?
Hangtown.
Well, it's, I mean, to me, it's just, you know, when you want to tell the kind of the whole story, it kind of is important. First and foremost, I think there were only six races the whole season.
Yeah.
So you had 12 motos. That's
not a lot of time to
say. It's not a lot of time to make it up. But we talked about the claiming rule, and that was a big important part of it, where the Yamaha bikes, when I signed with Yamaha, I was like, this is cool, because the water-cooled Yamaha was pretty cool. Bob won, and there was no question having water-cooled engine at the end of a 40-minute moto plus two laps in a 125. It was a big advantage. You know, maybe it wasn't. I honestly think there were other bikes that might be more horsepower, faster. I think the Suzuki's were really good in the beginning of the race and all that. But, you know, once the moto wears on and 10 or 20% of your power fades away with heat, I think that water cooling was a big advantage at the end of the race. And I was excited to have, you know, Yamaha, really honestly, by my second national, I think it was at Midland, Michigan, the Yamaha guys were over there talking to my dad, going, hey, what's your kid going to do next year, kind of a deal. And my dad's like, what? He's got three motos under his belt and is a pro, and you're asking me? I don't know. You have to ask him. You know, I mean, really, all his dad's to ask him what he wants to do. So at that point, Yamaha really was kind of, you know, saying, hey, we'd like you to consider riding for our team next year. And so as it ended up, I ended up signing Yamaha mid-season to ride the Trans-USA. So I signed my Yamaha first contract just 2 months after turning pro in September of that year. But so when we went into that season, Yamaha made the decision, unbeknownst to me, that we weren't going to run water-cooled bikes because of the claiming rule, that they were going to, the Europeans could run water-cooled bikes, but our bikes were going to be a modified, they were going to be the works bike, but they were just going to have air-cooled top pins on them. And so what happened to us when they brought them over here, they didn't bring them over here months in advance to test them. Honestly, they would bring, like, the bikes would arrive maybe a month before the Hangtown opener in April. And so they called us up and said, hey, the bikes arrived. Okay, cool. Let's go up and see them. And we went and tested them at Indian Dunes. And you remember Indian Dunes had that sand wash behind there. So we're like, hey, Plymouth is sandy. We got to go find somewhere to ride in the sand. So they modified a track and we ran out in the wash. And then that happened was we went out there and rode it, and by the time we hit about the second berm in the sand, the bike had no power, and it fell off the power band, and you couldn't get it to, three clutches later in a downshift, you couldn't get it to come back. Something was wrong. There was no question that was not right, and we couldn't figure out what it was. We spent about half a day and finally said, this is a lost cause. So they contacted Japan. They figured out it was a piston ring. They had some problems with it. They were going to make a new one, and then everybody loaded up, drove home, and waited for the new part to arrive, and my teammate was Bob Hanna at the time, and he went out and continued racing Supercross and did all this stuff. And so I went back and just kept practicing on my stock bike, and then when they finally got the new piston, They said, hey, we need you to come and test this thing because Bob's racing and he's busy. And so I came out and tested it. I said, yeah, it's night and day difference. It's good. So I wanted to ride it a little bit, but my mechanic's like, look, we're a week and a half away from Hangtown. You're not going to go thrash your race bike. I got to build it and get it ready, go home and go practice. And so that's what we did. Showed up at the first race at Hangtown about 15, 20 minutes into the moto. We had never ridden the bikes more than 5 to 10 minutes maximum at any given time. And about 20 minutes into the first moto, both Bob and myself, bikes stopped shifting. And they would only shift down. They would not shift up. And so we didn't know what happened. And what ended up happening was they had left two little small water pump bearings in the cases because the motor itself was still the water-cooled bottom end. It just didn't have an actual water pump in it or the radiator on it. And those bearings went into the shift fork area and wouldn't allow
the engine would heat up. Bearings would fall
out. Bearing falls out. Just exactly what you do. You put when you put a main bearing in now, you put the bearing in the freezer, you heat the case up, and it falls right in. So our bikes quit shifting, so I ended up putting in first gear like an idiot and rode around for a little while. And I finally was like, riding around first gear, you got to pull in. So I pulled in. Bob pulled in pretty right within minutes of me. Bob was in too. And so both of us DNF'd. And then they decided to, I remember my mechanic was pulling that case off. And he got yelled at by the team manager. What are you doing? You don't have time for that. Just put the spare motors in. So they both put Bob's mechanic, Keith McCarty, and my mechanic, Jim Felt, put new spare motors in, and the same damn thing happened the second moto.
Yeah.
And so I pat myself on the back of being 16 years old thinking, okay, wait a minute. The bike shifted down, but it wouldn't shift up. And I tried to shift it one time down and then back up, and it wouldn't shift. I didn't touch the shifter for 20-something minutes, and I left it in third gear. For me, you know, that was what got me, probably won me the championship. Fact that I was able to keep going around the track in third gear. Danny was hour and a half ahead of everybody, but there was a guy named Pat Richter, if you remember him riding across Fox. And I remember seeing after a while, it's like, he's not pulling me anymore. Like, he's still 10 seconds ahead of me, and there's about 10 more minutes left in this race, and I'm thinking to myself, God, I'm kind of babying the bike. And so I started pushing the bike a little harder than I probably should have, but at that point, you're so frustrated, I don't care if the thing blows up, kind of a deal. Mm-hmm. And I started gaining on the guy, and then pretty soon, on the last lap, I passed Pat, and I got second. Bob continued to circulate, and I think he was stuck in a lower gear than I was, and I think he ended up 16th or 17th. I scored 4 points. So we left, Yamaha left, hang down with our tails between our legs. Danny left with 50-point perfect day, and I had, you know, I ended up with 22, which was way more than I probably should have had. Bob had 4, and then we went to the world's roughest sand track in the entire world, and Danny, luckily for the Yamaha guys, you had a failure or seizure or something the first
What happened?
Yeah, that was at
Keysburg, Illinois. It's called Sandy Oaks.
Yeah. Still there?
I was told it was. We went back in 81 at Yamaha to test our 500s before Southwick, and I hated it just as bad in 81. And I've seen interviews where Bob Hanna says it was the roughest motocross track he ever raced in his life.
It is.
He ended up winning both motos, I believe, right? And I think I went like 7-2 or something. Danny had a DNF.
I can't remember what happened in one moto.
I think your bike. You told me one time your bike seized or started seizing or did seize.
Yeah. That was. I think that's what it was.
But honestly, and this is accolades to Danny, and I mentioned this to you this morning before we were getting ready to shoot. In the United States, if there's a Mount Rushmore of sand riders, I mean Danny's for certain he's on it.
Yeah.
And I don't know, is it Yucca Valley? How did you get so damn good in the sand? Just because you're strong as an – I mean, like, he's a fit, like his dad gymnast-style body and just – I mean, you're like – he's fantastic. Look at what he did to Lommel for the 81 Motocross Nations team.
Yeah, you don't win at Lommel unless you can ride sand.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I think probably Yucca Valley, just practicing out there doing the laps. You know, Mark Blackwell built that track actually originally.
Really?
Yeah, Roger and Mark went out and kind of laid out the track and – they were going to do some testing. But anyway, it had hills, sand, everything. So I think I did a lot of laps out there, so probably. And then the third round
was Midland, Michigan, another sand track. So that series, when I saw the schedule, it's 6 races long.
Yeah, Hangtown, Midland,
and I'm like,
Keysburg.
Carlsbad, rock hard, concrete, like where can Saddleback, second moto, garbage. I mean, like I'm used to riding Blue Groove hard pack, and the schedule is like I got no chance. And I knew Danny,
you know where I think I really liked I got in the sand. I realize is the Florida series.
Yeah, You kicked my ass there too.
Yeah, that's. Yeah. I think that's.
You taught me a lot there, though. You taught me a lot.
You know,
down there.
Like you said, we'd all go down there for a month, and just practice in the sand. And I got to really like it. You know, just flow, kind of.
Do you remember the Sports Center at Orlando? It was called. I think they did race a couple times there, but it was more of a practice weekday. There was another track that, I mean, he killed me there. But I remember racing kind of competitively where we talked about that YouTube video, Gainesville. But Danny was, he taught me how to race the sand.
Where were you guys staying down there? What tracks were you riding?
Orlando, mostly.
Orlando area. There's Cocoa Beach.
another one I hated. Yeah.
And Orlando, Gainesville. St. Pete.
Yep. St. Pete, but they had the national.
And those were all sandy, huh?
Yeah.
All Florida.
So all the teams would go down there in the winter and just train for a month.
Yeah.
It was kind of nice.
Yeah, Danny definitely taught me, went racing with him taught me a lot down there because he was just really good. I think I overcharged corners coming in trying to do like the late breaking thing. And Danny was, you know, he broke appropriately, but I think he had a lot
carry
of good
more
carry smart when I started realizing, okay, and don't be so heavy. Don't be heavy in the berm. Danny was like, you realize you don't plow into the berm, you kind of ride the light side of it. And Danny taught me a lot of that stuff just following him.
Well, it is such a skill set watching hurlings ride sand.
Oh, yeah,
today is like,
yeah. And our best American rider, I think, I mean, to me, when I say, I still think Tomac's probably our best American rider, and he's not the lightest, but he's winning Daytona, what, four times now and all that stuff. And I've seen him ride at Latvia in the MX of Nations, crashing in the first corner, coming from dead last, and would have clearly won the moto if he didn't dip over with two to go right behind Glenn Koldenhoff and to pass all those guys that he went through. That was probably one of the most.
Yeah,
he's another one that's
but he doesn't ride light. He's got his own style.
No, I know. That's a different thing.
He flattens the track out because he's just plowing through.
Yeah, bumps. He's
good, so strong.
And Bob was always a very good sand rider, obviously, too.
Yeah.
But Danny was fantastic. So.
Thanks.
All right. So that season, as it got closer to the end, it got ridiculously tight, right? You two were only a few points apart going into the final. Was Bob was still in it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He wasn't in the chance. I don't. Well, he had a.
No,
well,
he was actually. Looking back, and this is something I mentioned. I didn't know this. By the fifth moto of that season, Bob was ahead of me in the championship, and I didn't know that. And he was already in second place behind you. I was in fourth place behind Pat Richter, was in third, and I was in fourth. What cost him the championship, a chance for the championship, was his performance at Rio Bravo.
That was Rio Bravo.
I won the second moto at Midland, and I was like, wow, I just won a moto in the sand. Like, that to me was like, oh my God, you know, these guys were like using me as a punching. I mean, first and foremost, again, I was a second fill-in rider for, you know, I was just kind of like the guy that was supposed to be pretty good in a year or two. I was the rookie kid. But the fact that I won the second moto at Midland, I was like, okay, gosh, I maybe going to be able to kind of compete with these guys a little bit. You know, I don't know. And back then, nobody had a perfect moto. I swear, your bike was always, there's always
something going on.
Yeah. You know, the bike's cutting out or doing, like, these are air-cooled 125s and... But the going to Rio, and Danny had won there the year before, like we talked about earlier, you know, and Rio was a good track for me. And for me to win the second moto at Midland and then to go 1-1 at Rio, and then I think Danny was maybe second at Rio, and Bob was like fifth both motos. So that gap is what changed things and really started setting up, you know, as we kind of closed in on Danny on the points. And it wasn't until the final motos at San Antonio and I got a good start and won the first moto, then all of a sudden it was like, okay.
Within a couple of points.
Was it three points, I want to say?
No, it was five. It was five. And then Bob was like 12 or 14. The only way I remember, I finally went back this literally just a year or so ago and looked. Danny would have had to finish about 17th or 16th, 17th, something pretty high in order for Bob to win the championship. But me, I just had to win, and Danny had to do third or worse.
Yeah.
And so that's what set it up. And, of course, what happens, I get a crappy start, and I don't think you were up front either.
No, in the second moto.
Neither of us were great. Bob got the whole shot, and it was like, oh, now we're in a world of trouble. And I think Danny, you and I maybe battled up towards that for the front, but once I got into second, it was I read Cycle News' coverage, and they were saying that I was closing, but it was completely out of time, and there was no way I was going to catch him.
We were back pretty far in dealing.
And what was going through your head? Because I'm sure you knew the math, and with Brock in front of you, you're thinking, I'm in position.
Well, I just blew it on the start and the final moto. That was it, really. That's kind of really what happened. Yeah. And, I knew it was going to happen. If this situation, we knew, it was obviously going to happen. So I just tried to do the best I could, and just was no time. There was just the end, you know? So it's like I could see Brock, and couldn't see Bob, actually. Bob was out there, and he was
gone.
But,
I mean, to this day, I mean, obviously, Danny and I, our friendship has lasted for – and he – to. And I feel for Danny. There's no question you lose championships, and I've lost. I've been second place multiple times too, and I've lost championships by a point or two. It's painful. There's no question. I'm not trying to say.
Well, we can all cry in our beer over that. At least you guys have other ones.
No, and I just in Danny's situation, it's like but Danny. The one thing with Danny is he's never held it against me.
Oh no.
And here's an interesting point. And I asked. Remember asking you this question. In 1976, there were times where my dad would tell me, because one time my dad was always awesome. He never, ever, he never came in after the races and told me, you screwed up, dude. And I don't know if your father was ever you could have done better. Did he ever try to armchair court?
No.
And I don't think you ever told me he did either. And my dad never did that. He's like, I can't do what you're doing. I'm not going to tell you what you're doing wrong, And I always, that was all, but he was supportive. Mm-hmm. One of the only times my dad ever kind of just said, what the hell were you doing? Was when I pulled over at Midland, Michigan in 76 and kind of let Marty Smith go by me. And I was like, I was holding him up. He's going for the championship. He's holding him up. He shot everything he had in the first moto and trying to race, with the win. And he was content being behind you. You just let him by. But he did used to tell me once in a while that Billy wasn't Billy Grassi was your teammate, and that he would kind of my dad would say it was kind of pulled over, let Danny go. He wasn't stopping, but he would not battle Danny.
Yeah.
And I asked you, do you remember asking this? Why was Billy so friendly to let you go? And you told me Marty Smith and Danny were dicing for the championship in the 76 125s. You and Marty were neck and neck, and it was for second.
Right.
But for you, it was important to get second. And you couldn't remember at the time if it was you either tied for second or you were, but I looked at the points, and Danny finished 1 point behind Marty. So yeah. Billy, who only rode some races, he'd miss a race for a knee, and then he'd come back, but he could run up front, no problem. He would race up towards the front all the time. And if he was in Danny's way, he would let Danny go kind of. So it's not something that didn't happen in our sport, because it absolutely did. In Yamaha's situation, there's no – I mean, what's Yamaha at that point in the race? Danny wasn't going to finish 14th, so Bob was not going to win the championship. Mm-hmm. And if we stayed where we were – Yamaha wasn't going to win.
Yeah.
Who's paying all the bills out here? So I would have done the same for Bob, no question.
But exactly. Yeah. We all would have done the same thing. Yeah, it's normal.
And Danny and I were both riding Suzukis. I would have pulled over for Danny.
The only problem was the guys that put it on paper.
Oh, I know, on a chalkboard.
Oh, my God. I didn't even know what happened until I saw the paper afterwards.
Was it McCarty who wrote it?
Yeah, Keith. Yeah.
Because Bob was just being Bob a little bit. He didn't want to do it, right?
Yeah.
He waited until the very last second.
Yeah.
Well, and he rode off into the woods after the race, and took him hours to come back, and he was visibly distraught.
And I understand that. I'm not saying he didn't ride off into the woods, but if you see, there's a picture that was floating around recently in Racer X, where Davey Coombs has a copy of it. That picture was taken, I think, the morning of, or just honestly, I think it's minutes before we kind of got our gear and went to the first moto. And you see there's there was Kenny Clark, who was the team manager, and myself and Bob, and we're all sitting in lawn chairs next to each other. So there really wasn't that. And I never even had the opportunity to go, hey, thanks, Bob, for doing that. And I never, Danny and I have been able to talk about it years. It's no question, Danny. It's like the last person I wanted to have to win a championship was like that. And it had to be painful for Danny. And there's no question painful for it, because you think you got a good chance of winning a championship, and it all kind of slips away.
Yeah, but I looked at it differently. I always kicked myself in the ass for what I did from the other.
Yeah. You had 12 opportunities.
Exactly.
You won
one
two.
One stupid thing here or one this or one that. You always look back at that. Not at the finish result, but at everything else.
Well, the DNF, like you said. Yeah. I mean, there's so many things.
And it all adds up in the days.
And there were 125 air-cooled bikes, and we all had our problems. You know, the Yamaha guys had all theirs right up front. And no question about it. And
I think it speaks volumes about your character, the way you handle it.
I agree.
Because I've never heard you say, I've never seen anything written where you're like, ah, that was bullshit. Yamaha, you know, team tactics. And, you know, it was sort of like the veil. People all kind of knew it's motorsports. I mean, there's a lot of money that these teams put in. And if they can switch guys' positions and win a title for Yamaha, I mean, you can't get mad at them. But that with the pit board, it was like on display for the world. Like, this happened.
Yeah.
And I think that
they saw how it happened. You were supposed to talk about in the back room.
Yamaha had all, you know, they put five guys on the race and they were going to, like, this wasn't the Russian fault. And it happened a couple years earlier, the GP.
But we had other guys. Pierre Karsmaker shows up to ride the 125 class.
Mike Bell, my goodness, Mike Bell was one of our teammates too. Mike Bell finished fourth that day. It wasn't like he got 44th. He was fourth.
On a 125.
Mike was CMC number one on a 125. Mike grew up riding 125s for years. And we mentioned Kelvin Franks and his crazy bikes. I drove all the way to Irwindale one time to watch Mike ride a twin cylindered 125 TZ. It was a TZ 125 motor. But the point was, we all did. Suzuki did what they could. They gave Koji Masuda and some other guys some top level bikes, and they got in there. And Koji rode real hard that day too and did pretty well. And the stupid part about it.
So we all had to pass these guys. Brock and I had to pass all through all these guys. Yeah, shitty starts. Exactly. Yeah. We had to pass. These guys are never there. You know,
You got to go balance.
Bell, Brigitte, God dang it.
Get out of the way, dude. We're coming through. But the funny the part, too, is that it's like, you know, the Yamaha, these guys weren't there to knock Danny down.
No.
But the difference was, you know, again, at Keysburg, your bike tying up and you're nursing it. I remember, like, Danny was nursing his bike and it finally seized, you know. So you're trying to think to my mind. And flat tires, oh, my gosh. You know, flat tires were not uncommon. You had to be careful to not break your bike. And DeCoster is a classic example about talking about how when he first rode the European bikes, if he broke the bike, stupid rider broke the bike. You know, that's your own fault. You should have not jumped so far or did this. And the Japanese were like, no, go please try to keep breaking the bike so we can find the weakest link. We'll fix that and we'll find the next weakest link and we'll continue on. So the bikes had problems back then. You had to be careful. You could easily, especially that place with all the mesquite trees and all that, you could get a flat tire pretty easily.
Yeah.
So Yamaha, I think, was there. Like, if Danny had any problems, got a bad start, fell in the first corner, had a flat tire, any of that stuff. And same with you guys. If Brock had a flat tire or blah, you know, you're there to grab points if the opportunity presents itself, not to knock somebody down and try to
And if you've got a points gap to close, you need a few of those guys just to fill in the spot.
Absolutely.
It's not necessarily about taking anybody. I mean, I've ridden for teams, and you get down to those. Usually it's pretty open all year, and then you get down to those last couple races, and then we all come in, and there's a talk.
Yeah.
Hey, look, we don't want you to get involved. We're not, no dirty business, but if he's coming up, you know, your teammate's coming up on you.
Don't make it easy for him to pass you. That's about it.
Let the guy buy
it. Don't make it hard for him. Yeah,
right.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's pretty standard.
Yeah, it's standard operating procedure, and it was standard operating procedure before that, and it was a standard operating procedure still to this day.
Yeah, it is.
And you have to understand, even though it's an individual sport, it's also a team sport. Yeah. Because I can tell you right now, if so-and-so on this team is out testing a motorcycle and he comes up with some new suspension setting or he comes up with some new engine combo, that guy is for certain going to share that information with his teammate.
Yeah.
If Adam Cincirillo comes up with something, like, man, I don't know how we just came across this, but man, the bike is way better on the starts than it's so much better off the start than it used to be. Tomac's going to have it on his bike.
Sure.
That's the team, because they're paying the bill for that brand. And that's awesome.
Yeah, and actually, when we were racing, we were doing testing. We were a little bit independent, definitely.
Trying to be.
You know, a little bit, yeah. So everyone had their own box van, their own. Yeah. Everyone would go practice and test a little bit on their.
Yeah, it was easier to keep all the little things to yourself.
Yeah, you'd try to, but there's some stuff you had to always
get that information to one of the engineers, and then eventually circle back.
Exactly.
Circle back. Don't get me started on that. But that was a thing in the box van days, is you and your mechanic would, maybe it was a jetting spec or it was a
Yeah,
just something small. Little. But you're like, this works really good. Shh, you know, let's not.
Yeah.
You'd kind of keep that stuff. But
but
big
then there's
things,
always that, like Danny said, there's always a Japanese engineer to turn in your sheet. And if he had your sheet, had this pilot jet, this main jet, this and that, and you turned it in and it was wrong, you're in big trouble.
Oh, yeah.
So if you turned it, if you turned in some fake one, say it's got a 45 pilot when it really's got a 50. Yeah, and if they catch you on it, they weren't going to. Mm. So point was, is that it ended up trickling down a week or two later. It was definitely in everybody's camp if they wanted it. But it just. Yeah,
so you weren't ever bitter about that. I mean, it was like,
seemed
really good
about
the way you
took
it.
No, it'd been nice to win a title and make a net. Big giant, check at the time, $10,000 to win a title.
Five.
Was it five?
Was it five?
Oh, mine was
$10,000.
Mine was $10,000.
Oh, I had the cheap team that I must have. I had $5,000 bonus for a championship, and it was $300 to win the overall at national. $300.
God, that's a lot of work.
Yeah, I think it was five.
Yeah, Suzuki paid more. Yamaha was they were in luxury position to have a bunch of. Yeah, it was crazy. It was 5,000. By next year though, it was 30,000 because Kawasaki came hot and heavy.
Oh really?
Oh yeah, Kawasaki came hot and heavy after me. And
yeah,
they didn't
sell bikes, but they had a lot of money.
They had marketing Kawasaki money. Yeah, they were good. They were always good about that. So yeah, so that first championship, I had a $5,000 bonus for that and $300 to win both motos. So. Yeah, it was
huge.
Yeah, you might have done better let him win. You could have both split
I
five.
I could have split
grand.
Five.
We should have talked about this earlier.
We wouldn't have had any. Wouldn't have to live with it for 47 years or whatever it's been. Yeah, exactly.
No, but it's been a great story. People always want to know kind of what it's like.
Yeah.
But
like I said, Danny, I've always respected Danny's. He was a grown man then, and it's unfortunately business. And yeah, dude, yeah, I get tired of I feel bad for Danny, and I of course I'm tired of hearing about it.
I'm sure. I know. So I drag you on here, and we
don't
be done.
No, but it's a legitimate. No, I don't think it shouldn't be discussed. But it's. I was surprised. I finally went back and started looking at every results, and I finally made an Excel spreadsheet, and I did not know. I did. I was like, I want to know kind of how this really happened because it got told it's so incorrect. Like, I did not know Bob Hanna was in second place in the championship after the fifth moto of the season, and I was still in fourth. He was ahead of me, and, I didn't know that. I mean, most people you talk to, it's like he pulled over for me every moto all the way through the year or something.
Yeah,
and
right.
It's like,
yeah.
And it's not how it happened. And I had a good run in there with counting the first moto of the last race in San Antonio where I'd won four of the six motos leading into that final moto.
Yeah.
So it was like, wow, like I won four of the last six motos leading into that final let Brock by moto. And it's like, well, somehow I won four of the six motos leading. That wasn't all luck.
Yeah,
How did that happen?
Do you think this would not even really be a discussion point if that pit board photo hadn't existed?
I don't think.
I would think it would even be.
No, it would never have existed.
No. And
The guy who wrote on the chalkboard.
Yeah, it was the photo, absolutely, because there was two people.
That was it.
The photo. And
yeah,
that's
photo. It's so notorious. It's
because what happened is just completely normal. You know what?
Yeah, yeah.
It just was written.
Yeah.
Misspelled,
by the way, too. Yeah. All right, so the following season, I thought this was an interesting move. You just jumped right to the 500 class.
In 78, yeah, I did, yeah.
What was that about?
Well,
I mean,
I did, too, by the way. You're
125
behind you.
To 500.
A year or two behind you, I did. I did the same thing from 80 to 81, right to 500. Like,
oh, yeah.
You'd already been racing
I liked the 500. It was really fun.
Yeah.
I mean, it just had so much power. And it just, at the time, I think it was the bikes were so light, we're talking about. They were really fun to ride.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, so 500 seemed to be the 250. I didn't like the 250 class for some reason. I don't know why. I did the CC and it just didn't have explosive power. You went from 125 was fun to ride because you're just
ringing its neck.
You're just ringing it and timing and you're flying in the turns. You can't. It's such a great class. It's really fun.
Yeah.
One little error. Hey, you go into a turn, you come out, you shift. It makes a huge difference. And so it's really challenging to ride a 125. On the other end, I think it's really challenging to ride the 500 because you have a heavier, big, powerful bike.
Yeah.
So it's like the extremes. Where the 250, I didn't
it's
really
a tweener.
Ever. Yeah.
You put it exactly right. The 125 takes a lot of talent to get it right at that edge and to keep it at that edge and to make it. And if you make one mistake, you lose momentum. Mm-hmm. 500, if you make one mistake, it throws you on the ground and beats the crap out of you. And you're like, wow, hey, stupid. That's
so the 250 class to me was kind of, I didn't really ever enjoy
it. People who weren't that precise could get away with it, and they got away with mistakes you couldn't get away with on the 500. And then you did things on a 125. Like if you did that on a 250, it wasn't so important because you got enough power to pull you out of trouble, and the 125 would bog and you wouldn't make any speed. So
My first choice would have been to ride the 500 world championship rather than a 250.
You just didn't have that choice.
Although
you've been competing against Lackey.
That would have been nice.
Well, it was nice that two Americans won
same year.
Pretty rad.
That is great. We'll get to that.
So that first season, how did that 500 class go? Was it kind of a learning curve?
No, actually, it went really well. I mean, I jumped on it right away. I felt really comfortable. We had a couple of mechanical problems at the time, and the suspension on the bike went from, I think, like 11 and a half, maybe right around 11-ish, to 13 inches on that bike, nearly 13.
Yeah.
So that's huge, bigger, taller than anything now. So, so all of a sudden you had this big giant pogo stick, you know, that going in a turn, didn't want to turn. You know, that was always, even to me, you know, the advantage of having a bike even that had 10 or 8 or 9 inches, you could just rail through turns, 12 inches, 11 inches, 10.
Yeah, it was, but once you started, it was actually, 300 was kind of a number, 300 millimeters, and then they started to mess with 320, and I remember that they thought 340 was, we can try 340, and that's, the Suzukis, I think, messed with 340, and we messed with them, too. And
the photos look odd. It's like some of those old Makos.
They were really tall, and they were comfortable straight across the big, deep bumps, but then turning was just so slow, and they just stand up in the turn, push you through the turn. So it was really hard bike to ride.
Yamaha's first 320 and 340 bike that they played with was 81, and they had water cooling up high. And I remember literally falling over every other corner. And Mike Bell fell twice a lap, three times a lap, and at the sand track out in the Palm Springs area. Same kind of a thing. Couldn't turn them.
And in America, for some reason, Suzuki didn't want to go back and say, you know, at the beginning, hey, these things are too tall. Well, let's try. They didn't want to go backwards. They want to always go forward. In Europe, they would do that. They would say, no, it didn't work this year. I want to win the title. Let's go back with our other stuff. But in America, we kind of seemed like, let's just keep going this way, keep developing and see if it works. And so anyway, the bike worked okay. I won a few nationals and with the bike in Lake Whitney.
There you go. I was looking at your numbers. I wrote some notes down here. Yeah, exactly. You
Whitney.
Won. Whitney 78 was your first 500 race. Yep.
Right. Yep. And then I think I might have won one later on in Florida or something. I'm not so sure.
No, that was 79. I'm gonna look at my notes here that I have. Yep, there you go. Mr. Back-to-back again, 1979, your championship season. 500 champion, 1979.
Yeah, who won? Brigitte won in 78.
78 was the year Yamaha won all the titles. And then 79, you bounced back in 500 cc's, and you went back-to-back at Southwick and Atlanta Motor Speedway, where they're going to have the next three Supercross races in 1979. I won the 125s that day.
Yeah,
you won the 500s.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And we raced a national right behind the big international, the speedway, the NASCAR's track.
Oh, it's the same place they're having it?
Same track having it, and now they're having it on the infield where it's like Daytona. But Danny and I raced.
Pretty much a flat area.
Yeah,
Danny and I
Danny and I won a Mr. Pibb sponsored. He won the 500, and I won the 125 class that day.
What do you remember from that day?
I remember the track pretty well. It's kind of soft. It was soft, and I think they were mixing corn shells into the ground in that track. You know, the
corn husks. Yeah.
So it was like fluffy.
Yeah,
fluffy.
And they had
some
stuff in the woods too. We went through some.
If you go to hit a berm, you just go right through it.
So
you go through the woods. They had one like tabletop jump. Mm-hmm. And that was about it.
And who were you racing against that year? Who was in that 500 class?
Well, Mike Bell for sure. I mean, that was my main competition throughout the whole year. And Brigitte was out there defending his title. Rex Staton, I think he was riding. And then Chuck Sun, I believe, was Chuck out there in 80.
Yeah, he would have been in 79. He would have been in there too because he won the championship the next
Chuck
year.
Chuck, and then Goat Brecker was out there. Goat.
Oh, Goat.
Yeah.
You did win a national, the Red Bud National that same year. You won Red Bud.
Okay. Right.
And then tell us about the last couple of races that got pretty close there. I remember that Metrolina was the second to last race. It was in, I think it was in Carolina there, and you split moto wins with Mike Bell. Bell went 2-1 for the overall, but you went 1-2, so there was no blood loss there.
Yeah.
But going into the final race at St. Pete, you won the first moto, which you had to have felt pretty good about that. Okay, now you got a little cushy here. And then Bell was second, and then the second moto coming down to it, you got some cushion. And what happens? Didn't you go down the first corner?
Yeah,
that's just what
you're thinking. Oh no, you know, not that, again!
Not another stinking San Antonio again.
Brock, he actually had. It was a pretty good starter sometimes when he had to be, but he did. He started really well. He had a pretty decent. He wasn't like Jeremy McGrath whole shot.
No, Michael Lessie.
Michael Lessie. Yeah, sure. But I'll never forget the turn of you going in that one turn bitching shot of you too coming out of the turn on the 500 that one year
at St. Pete.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
That's a great shot.
That's 81. Yeah.
Yeah, that was an 81. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. So I went down
with the whole shot. He's trying to tell me he actually did a whole. I actually did get decent starts. No question.
Yeah.
So you had the whole shot and went down.
No. I can't. I don't know where I was when I went down, but I'm laying on the.
He wins the first moto though, right?
For my bike.
This is the final race. Like it's like okay, I could probably finish like 9th or 10th here. I'm pretty good. I got this covered here. And then he goes in the first corner and gets wadded up into a crash.
Yeah, so last to wherever, I think. I don't know what I finished in the final moto.
Fifth.
But just enough.
Just enough.
Yeah, and Bell won it.
Were you panicked or were you pretty good about it?
3 points. The championship. Oh. So the championship came down to 3 points.
Yeah.
Yeah, 3 points.
Yeah. So I would have been maybe 12 or something difference if I had finish in the top two or three, but
yeah,
I mean,
but so he if he would think it was in on the converse side of that, if you would have finished eighth or worse, you might have lost.
Did Bell win the last moto?
Yes, he did. He won the overall.
You know, I think we all know. I think everybody knows who they're really racing against in the championship. You get to know everybody where they're going to be at the end of the day.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like like even on the weekend, I could see watching the Supercross race even today. Those guys know that they're going to pass pretty much. They can even if they start, you know, 18th, they're going to work all the way up to third.
Yeah.
You know,
a Supercross, for instance, it's kind of the top five or six or so. Yeah, basically those guys are kind of separated.
And the stronger guys will know, and then they can. Yeah. And that's why I didn't really feel nervous about it, especially being on a sand track.
You and I would have been nervous. No. This guy's like, I wasn't really that nervous.
No,
Mr. Calm guy.
No. I guess I was nervous. But, you know, you're nervous anyway. Your stomach's going.
Yeah.
You probably got up and rode great. Huh?
Yeah, exactly. Worked your way through it and got in fifth and said, okay, I got enough cushion here. I'm good now. But it's always nerve wracking.
Yeah, I think actually fifth on the sand track, 45 minute motos.
Yeah.
I probably should have been higher up. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I'm positive you could have gone higher, but I was there that day too. I think it was more like, no, the championship, you're fine. You've got two spots to spare here. Just chill out. Don't fall
just
down. Don't
run
out of gas. Don't do something. Don't do.
Probably.
But what really set up, I think, in your case, that really caused that, like, I think two or three rounds beforehand, Binghamton, New York, at Broome Tioga, a DNF second. And ironically enough, Greg Tice for LOP, so that was the year before Marty Motes won the championship, but Greg Tice won the first moto. It was an LOP privateer.
That's right.
Never even heard that name.
Yeah, Greg Tice. Yeah. And he's a strong kid from Omaha, Nebraska, just like football player strong. And then the second moto, Jimmy Ellis, Hall of Famer Jimmy Ellis, first Supercross champion back in the 70s there on a Can-Am. Jimmy Ellis won the second moto on a factory Honda, and so neither you or Bell were able to win a moto, but the DNF in that first moto, and you backed it up with a second, that put you in its position at the last round or so there at St. Pete, where this is closer than it needed to be or should have in your heart for some.
That's funny. When you rolled across the line, that had to feel great, having lost that 77 title by such a close margin, and then, you know, didn't get one the following year, and now here you are, you finally win one.
Yeah.
What was that?
No, I mean, you know, it's, you know, it's great to win, you know, finally after 4 years trying, and, you know, you're, it's, I mean, we all have great relationships with our mechanics, and we all have our good points, bad points. But at the end, you know, you forget about all that stuff, you know.
And who was your mechanic? Tell
Pat,
us.
Pat.
Pat Alexander. Yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, that just, you know, those memories will last forever. They're great.
And Pat, do you remember Pat? And I don't know if it was right before that race. It was somewhere right around that same time. Pat was Danny's mechanic, and it was very common that mechanics would, you know, Holiday Inn, you'd pull up in your box van, you'd rebuild your bike all during the weekend.
Yeah.
Pat got all done with the bike, got all ready, and he took it for like just a test ride, and he looped out. Do you remember? Looped out in like shorts.
Oh, no.
Shorts. Yeah, he looped out a 500 works bike, and he skidded himself up pretty good after that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was one of those bad lessons there, but yeah, and other than your immediate family, you're a mechanic, and so I was probably the happiest guy for Danny.
Yeah.
And that's why I remember that. I remember the race pretty well, because I was glad you won your championship. You know, we were Danny was somebody I raced with for many, many years, even local race all the way to the pros. And again, you never heard sour note out of Danny, and I've always respected. We've been, like I said, you know, it's one of my closest moto friends for certain for all these years.
Was there somebody in particular, a moment that stands out, like who are you really happy with?
No, my parents, probably. Yeah, absolutely. They were, you know, it's the first person you get on the phone call, you know, with your parents.
When your dad was a racer, so he gets it, right? Like, he knows how big of a deal that probably was.
Yeah. And I was kind of someone that kind of always wanted to do things myself. I didn't have, you know, my dad would, you know, he was working, he had his own business going on. And so I think I don't know, like kids are, you know, they want to do things by themselves. So I kind of like really wanted to do everything by my own. I didn't want to listen to my parents. I wasn't a good.
You're a normal kid.
I've never heard that from a kid before, a teenager.
But it's true.
Yeah.
It's just like my kids.
Yeah, exactly. So
For those who don't know who Pat Alexander is, too, by the way, he is obviously started as a mechanic.
Just
won a championship with you.
Just working for Suzuki, but he's.
Oh, did he retire?
He just retired. Yeah, so he's
77 or 76.
So
he started 76.
My very first national ever dropped the clutch at Red Bud, a qualifying race, and a guy named Terry Good, who has a MX website and a great collection of old works bikes in the Chicago area. He was there with his friend, and his friend was starting next to me. Took a photo. And in that photo, that's my first time I ever dropped a clutch. It's the only photo I know of from that day. And Pat Alexander is the man standing next to me right there with the he was working for DG at the time.
Yeah. Oh,
and as soon
as
we finished that 76 season, basically Pat and my dad were kind of the mechanics for the two DG riders. And then as soon as we finished in 76, he got a job with Suzuki. And, and Danny and Pat were together for
76, 78, 80.
So the entire time Danny was with Suzuki, which was up until he, you know.
80, 4 years we were together.
Danny was with 76. He signed with Suzuki in 76 and rode to 80. And then in 81, you signed with Honda.
Yeah.
But yeah, so.
Yeah, four,
did,
year, four
did
years.
Did Pat stay
that.
On as a mechanic longer, or did he get up into.
No, he did. He worked. Who did he work? I don't know who he worked for next, actually.
And then he went through the amateur sport, and they worked in the sport division, like obviously the motorcycle.
Well, 1990, when I got my first Suzuki support ride, it was through Pat Alexander.
He was a life.
Oh, yeah, no.
This guy's been there forever.
I know. 25.
I know. Think about that.
45 years.
So that's where he started. 76, he was with DG with me. First time I ever drove across the country in a box.
No, 43 years. It'd be about 43 years, right?
Yeah.
That's incredible. I might have to get him on here.
Yeah, exactly. So then after that, you went to Honda in 81, right?
Yeah. When Roger
went to Honda,
he went to Honda, and then he started working Honda as a team manager. And Honda really didn't have, you know, they kind of were a little scattered at the time, and they wanted to make a kind of like a push, come back, and so they hired, obviously having Roger, and then Roger, I think he knew me from Suzuki, and he knew I was available, so it was kind of and I thought that, you know.
Dave Arnold was managing, right?
Yeah.
And DeCoster was the team.
You know, so this comes back to me. I'm always thinking, you know, in the back of my mind, actually when I was racing for Suzuki, there was a few years I'd ask, hey, you guys have an opening in Europe? I always asked Suzuki, USA, you got anything? Because I always kind of, I started to think about it after
when did that
maybe
happen?
Maybe 77, 78.
Okay.
started thinking, so, hey, you guys got an offer opening over in Europe. Let me know. You know, I'd love to be able to go race in Europe. But it was tough at the time because no American was proven to be able to win a title. And they're not going to spend all the, you know, spend money on an unknown kind of a guy, you know, for 2 or 3 years developing an American to race in Europe. And the team, and the, so everything's pretty separated. There's nothing, you know, there's really not a lot of sharing.
Well, at that point, they were killing us. So why in the world would they bring an American guy?
Exactly.
Over?
That's probably why. And so, but I always threw it out there and asked.
And what was it about? So, like, that's what I'm interested is when you started looking at your going, oh, that might be rad. Well, I mean, those are the.
It was about that time.
Okay.
But just checking it out. And then that's actually went over myself in 79 to do a couple international races.
Those are the ones you were telling us about.
I have a question to ask you. The fact that the U.S. racing started really focusing more and more on Supercross. And Supercross became the main focus in the United States. Did that have any influence on it? Because I think it's, you know, I'm
oh, I think
first,
I've told you this, yeah, me. Because I didn't, yeah. I really didn't like Supercross that much.
My mechanic, he called it Stupid Cross. And so that, I don't know if that had anything to do with me always having kind of a crappy attitude about Supercross.
It did. I think it, because I saw it coming more and more towards Supercross already at that time.
Yeah. What years? Late 70s?
77, 78.
Yeah, it started getting more and more.
It was more and more emphasis on Supercross all the time already.
Yeah. That early, huh?
Yeah, and so it really got real heavy. Like, I didn't ride Supercross. My first 3 years with Yamaha, I didn't ride any Supercross. I mean, I borrowed, like, I begged them, hey, please let me ride, like, Daytona. They'd give me a YZ, like, literally a box stock motorcycle. Okay, here, you can ride this one, but that don't get hurt. You know, that kind of a deal, because it's sort of an outdoor. And then finally, I remember one of my only races, like, Supercross, I talked them into it at the very end of the year and let me race Anaheim after the champion 125s were over. But Yamaha sold almost like 10,000, 12,000 125s back then. It was like insane. Jeez. The amount of 125s that were sold. And it's like, look, that number one plate on that bike's all we care about. We hire you to win a 125 class. Supercross, we got Bob, we got all these other guys, and you know, you're just a kid and you got to go to high school, all that stuff. And it's kind of true. But Danny and I both kind of always viewed, you know, both of us always loved the World Championship, the motocross, those legendary tracks that were true motocross tracks. And as it got more and more and more towards the Supercross thing, finally I was like, look, I got to get back. I got to start racing Supercross. Barnett won LA Coliseum in 79, and I was racing racing Barnett all the time on the track. I'm like, he's winning. So I didn't start till 80. But I know you and I talked about, we never really embraced Supercross as like what we – that wasn't where our passion was.
And those early tracks were – they were pretty basic. I mean, there was nothing fun about them, but there wasn't like they were crazy big jumps.
Well, they were. I think they also.
What was it you didn't like about it?
No, the jumps were actually, some of them were. You'd get some.
I'll show you some photos where you're like, well, you guys are nuts jumping that far on those piles.
I guess on the equipment at the time, it's all relative.
But not only the equipment, it had been easier probably to ride some of the tracks. They were like a jump was straight and then it was had an angle. There was no ramp.
There was no perfect face.
There was nothing. It'd be better today.
I had this conversation with Scott Wallenberg about 1980.
Like, here's a straight and then the jump was an angle like this.
Like Excite Bike jumps, right?
Yeah, it'd almost stop you in the air. Now, how are you going to do that to do a double? It's like, and then you're in the air and you're looking at the same jump built as a peak. And you had to time it just right, just to barely land on the backside. Then it was flat again. So the jumps were kind of wacky because you had a bad face to take off. Now it's just perfectly, you know, they're just
nice transition. 12 inches of travel,
they're seat jumping, right? They're sitting down, and then jumping out and landing down on the downside of a nice round. Yeah. And they've learned that, you know, peaky second jumps aren't a good thing. You know, so I remember one time in Supercross racing Bercy, and we were walking around the track, and the track was had pretty gnarly jumps, kind of like I'm speaking about now. Mm-hmm. And I was with Håkan Carlqvist, and he walks. There's two like jumps exactly like this, built like two pyramids, right?
Yeah.
And he goes, I'm not. It's like he had some chew in his mouth. I'm not gonna jump that. Are you crazy?
Yeah, snuff. You know, it was snuff. The sweet dude, that snuff. I'm not jumping that jump. Yeah, yeah.
Hell, I'm not gonna jump that. I can't remember how he said it, but anyway, it was pretty funny. But they weren't forgiving the jumps.
Yeah.
And even the hoop section, the hoops were more random. They were square. They were sharper. They weren't perfect rounded. So there was a lot of, and to ride those bikes on them. Yeah, you had.
I guess it's not fair to say it weren't big jumps.
They were challenging, you know. And then you had, you know, like the. So I think there were some giant long, you know, tunnel jumps at the time. You know, remember they were giving you a bonus for jumping, you know, 120 feet or whatever.
But we grew up riding tracks around the hills in our house. And we didn't grow up riding these practice tracks where everybody right now, you show up and you've got all these groomed tracks and you pay your money and you go ride, and they've still got, even the outdoor tracks have almost supercross obstacles in them. And we had triple jumps that weren't meant to be triple jumps. They would make five of these peak jumps Danny was describing, and then some crazy person decided, okay.
Magoo or something.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, okay, we're going to do two, two, and one. Well, that's not good. Okay, how do we do this? We roll the first one, roost off of it, do two and two and go out. Okay, maybe. And then someone goes, no, I just went wide in the worm, jumped three and two. And I remember that happening in Pasadena. I'm like, oh crap, I got to do that. And it's like, and I ended up like, you finally get to doing it. And then you're just like, okay, this is not what I want to be doing, but I'm doing it. And I remember winning one time at Pasadena. I'm like, man, that was the worst race. I hated it. Cause the whole time, if you made one mistake, you were done. But I had that discussion with Scott Wallenberg, the 1980 LA Coliseum. That was my first year I actually rode the whole series, and I won the back-to-back. But the track was designed, we raced it 2 days in a row, and it was built to run clockwise and then counterclockwise or vice versa. So we raced it 1 day one way so every jump was exactly like Danny was describing. They were perfectly peaked to where you could run them either direction. And at the end of the race on the second day, it was hard and hot, middle of summer LA, the ground was concrete hard, and there was like 8 or 9 bikes of the 20 guys in the main event were broken wheels, because if you weren't perfect, like, you didn't want to come up short because you were for sure going to cartwheel and die. So then you had to jump long, so your air was always wanted to be on the long side. Well, then if you went too far, you flat landed and you broke wheels, so
you had a really short landing space.
So to bring it to serve, you know, to bring it back to where we're talking about, Danny, you knew supercross is where the trend is going, and now at this point I got my eye on Europe.
Well, you know, yeah, exactly. At the same time, I just didn't like the fact that, you know, I mean, we weren't really getting paid any differently to race the supercross races. You were doing more and more supercross races every year. I think we got up to, I don't know how many in the 80s.
At least 12 or 13, 14. Yeah,
and you know, the stadiums were full. Mm-hmm. They really were, right? Mm-hmm. And we're making like $1,200 to win overall, right?
So the money wasn't.
No,
any
but it's kind of like, wait a minute. The promoters selling out seats and the purse is $20,000 or whatever it was. It's
they're
like,
looking at the Nationals, like, going, these guys are making $5,000 for a title here. Well,
I don't know what.
These idiots are riding for free.
Yeah, they'll ride for nothing.
So none of the money comes from the event. It comes from the bonuses from your sponsors and everything. And I'm sure that's the same way now. So it's still in the back of my mind. So they're asking you to do all this risk for, no, it doesn't make sense to me. Anyway,
So one and done with Honda in 81 after that. And then that's when, like, how much through the 81, Roger, it was now the team manager at that point, because he retired, I think, in 80 on Honda, winning his last GP ever. And then you at that point were probably working a lot with Roger. Did he help you, or how did you jump ship over to Yamaha?
No, it was
coming from Suzuki.
It was Roger. I can't remember who I spoke with originally about it, but no, Roger was putting together a team, and we met at Honda, and that was it. I said, I got to try this. It's been 5 years at Suzuki, so I thought a change would be really, really good.
But then to Yamaha, how did you get from Honda to Europe?
But going back, how was that Honda versus Suzuki? I'm curious about that.
So I went to Honda really quick, and they had the previous bike I was practicing on at Saddleback before I did any race at the very beginning of December, I can't remember. Went down a hill, bottomed, crossed this rut where the Saddleback, where the track comes back onto the course. There's a big berm, and they're concrete berms, right?
Midweek turned Adobe turned.
I go down.
Concrete,
I hit it. The crossover bottom, and I rode the nose in towards Webco Hill.
Oh, goodness.
I can't remember how far. Yeah. I flipped and dislocated my wrist. The very first ride, I think, on a Honda.
Oh, wow.
So I had a dislocated wrist, broken bones, and that kind of wiped out the whole supercross, the whole thing. And I didn't get anything going together until the end of that year in the Nationals. I finally, I think, won a moto or two, or maybe won a race or whatever, at the very end of the 81 season. And then I was getting better right away. And then we put the team together to go to the Nations, Motocross and Trophy to Nations so that's kind of where.
Okay. And were you surprised
at your performance at the Diz Nations?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, for sure. I mean,
you've been looking at these Europeans as like the elite level.
Yeah, we had
and
no,
you guys roll
we
in
had
and
no idea. You know, you go out there having no idea where you stand until you're really racing, right? Until you things start, you start feeling and figuring it out really quickly. Mm-hmm. That we had some, I figured out we had some game going on right away, yeah. Right after the start. I could feel it, you know. Yeah. And so Johnny O'Mara did really, really well that day. He stepped it up. I mean, you know, that's actually true. It's Johnny, before Johnny won all of his titles. And
yeah, of course.
The next year, Donnie became Grand National mm-hmm. Champion, Supercross Champion.
Yeah.
Out there. So he was just on the verge, you know. Johnny was obviously done. So it was a good timing, I think, the whole thing, that the team came, a young team like that.
And you guys just, yeah.
And we didn't have any, you know, ideas of the race, you know, weren't
there's no preconceived notions.
Exactly.
You just went there and raced,
right?
Do you think it's interesting to hear you talk about the sort of the team unit or the camaraderie that you guys had? I feel like in recent years, since we started getting beat, we don't have that. You know, the pro circuit guys are parked over here with Kawasaki, and this Yamaha guy's over here.
And the team thing is the way to go. I mean, one brand is it's really the way to go. It really is, and you know, it's hard
it doesn't have to be one brand per se. But what is dictating it is so much different.
The manager of the team, maybe.
Yeah, somewhat, but it's also what's dictating more than is also the main sponsors of the different teams too. You know, they want their rider. If it's, you know, a Monster Energy team rider, he wants his guys with the Monster Energy guys.
Right.
So there's all sorts of, and then manufacturers, their sponsorship. I do agree there's something missing right now, and I think it's time for a little shakeup myself, but something needs to happen.
Well, for sure now the teams aren't as big as they were kind of back when, you know, when you don't have like four or five, you know, Yamaha had four or five and a few backup riders, six guys.
Right.
The teams were pretty big.
Yeah.
But the Nations teams, though, that is only – you know, you've really got three guys. It's not that hard to do. They need to figure out a way, even if it's circle the wagons and have these guys have their vans around the outside, they need to have, like, one centralized location where everybody kind of stays and hangs out.
There needs to be an American pit.
And if
Kawasaki wants to have a rig here, their banners here, cool.
But
Yamaha could be
here.
The
pit is the hub.
That's
in dead center. And you guys can have your stuff around the peripheral part of it or whatever it is, but that's where the team and the riders and everybody, and it really is. And I being a member of the team, I mean, we won three times, once in the Motocross Nations, I won twice in the Trophy to Nations, which is this basically exact same thing. You're just on 250s versus that. But I remember us all sitting, there was really a photo circulating that it's dear to my heart because it's myself and Barnett and Bailey and Ward, and we're sitting there in Angro, Belgium before we won the first time I ever went over in 83, following on the footsteps. And that was the first kind of like, okay, this is the A-team American team. This is the best four guys that we know we can field, and we're there. But we're sitting elbow to elbow, and this is minutes before they're going, okay, time to go to the park for me and go race. And we're like sitting there with our race faces on, but we're having that moment, and it's probably the same feeling that you guys had over there. It's like, listen, you know, Danny and Johnny and Danny, we don't know what to expect here, but just give it everything you got until it's over and the final checkered flag falls in the second moto, and we'll just add it all up at the end. And nobody wants to be the weak link. Nobody wants to be the guy that does the worst in the race. But also, you guys, you know, didn't have any visions of grandeur. And then at that point, you just did your best effort, and it ended up being shocking. It wasn't even, I mean, honestly, it wasn't that close. The points, I think you guys only had like 20 or 21, and the next nearest team had in the 40s.
Is that right?
At Lommel, they didn't win by 1 point. It wasn't
like. You guys
like,
crushed them.
Yeah, they crushed it.
And then in Germany, it was close. It was closer.
Yeah, you guys had a lot of, Germany, there's a lot of different problems. That's on the 500 at the Bilstein race. But at Lommel, you guys won.
I think, though, the team, whether it be, mm-hmm. just the American team camaraderie. Mm-hmm. It started off at the Lommel and Germany in 81, and then every year it kind of kept that same. It's kind of wearing off now. I think it is.
There was plenty of times when you had a Honda, Kawa, and Yamaha guy or whatever.
There were.
We still work together. Yeah. I don't know. It's
the year so I true. Went. The year that's I true. Went, we had a Suzuki, we had a Honda, we had a Yamaha,
Kawasaki. But you guys were
both, but you were inches, elbows talking about what are you doing, especially the race of the Trophy to Nations. It was a crazy gnarly track, and it was like, wow, okay, what are you doing over there? Because that's not your traditional motocross track. And so absolutely. And I go to these races, and I'm disappointing to see. Like even back then, you guys were all the traditional blue helmet with the white skunk stripes, and that was the American color for a helmet. And nowadays, I have to have my energy drink, whatever. Like, deuce, I mean, come on. They need to write the contracts where, the Motocross Nations is a kind of an outlier that, we're going to run team helmets here, mm-hmm. we're going to be a team. Yeah. And what a
cool vibe to be able to sit there with those other guys who you're normally competing with, and you don't share secrets, and then you're going, hey, man, I found this line here, look at this. And, mm-hmm. you're trying to help each other. Like, that's got to be just a neat vibe and a feeling that you don't ever get again, right? I mean,
no, that's true.
I feel there's a little of that right now in the Americans that are riding right now. I think there's, I feel bad, honestly. I feel bad for Eli Tomac because I've seen some of the most phenomenal rides ever. I mentioned earlier in Latvia, and I feel bad. I want him to be on a winning team. I think he deserves it. You know what I mean? But I think. There's no question I was there when Cooper Webb, and all he did was make the smallest mistake, and his rear end spun around at Majora, Italy, and it really ended up probably costing the Americans the win. Mm. And I feel for him like crazy because I know he was stoic about it. It hurt, and I know it hurt, and he cares. And I tell you right now, Cooper Webb, not only because of what he's doing right now, but he'd be your first call right now.
That guy
wants to win that Motocross Nation. He's not announcing it to the public, but I can promise you he would like to win that Motocross Nations, and especially for America. And I think Barsha kind of has that attitude, and he's elevated his game to be right there. And I would hope Eli would be in a situation where presented with the right team and the right opportunities, like, we're going to do things a little bit different here. Like, if I were team manager at the one at Red Bud, for instance, I would have not put him in the MX1 class because I think there was this huge pressure to have him and Jeffrey Herlings race each other, and mm-hmm. I would have just thrown him in the open class, and I don't think Barsha would have gave one hoot about who he raced against. Throw him in the MX1. So try to do things to alleviate some of the pressure from these guys, because it's already a pressure packed race because you're already on American soil and all these different things and expectations. So there is, and Danny, you guys were such that year, first year in 81, it's like there was really nothing expected of you guys. You guys were kind of like almost belittled a little bit, like, us as a no-name team from America. Right. And they wasn't. And so that was what was so awesome about it. It was the David and Goliath story all over. It was just awesome that you guys did that.
True.
That led into your Yamaha deal, right? Who was running it? Was it Heikki Mikkola or he was?
Heikki Mikkola was the, I really wasn't sure at the time. I just was looking for a ride.
Wanted to go 500 was your first choice, right? Being a 500 champion.
Yeah, I would have taken anything, not 125, 250 or 500 for sure. But, there weren't a lot of opportunities. Yeah. So I was kind of lucky, I think. I was there, and I kind of reached out to somebody who knew Heikki, and they were looking for a rider. It was just that easy, kind of easy, but, and then I let him know my intentions, and he jumped on it right away.
Wow, that's... Hmm.
And he basically almost came up with an offer within a day of that event. After that.
Did you negotiate it at all, or did you just jump on it?
I did. I did. I negotiated. Okay. But, I had a few days. Like, this process went on maybe a week. And, the one of the things is that I was really looking forward to the Honda, what was coming with Honda. We were talking about that earlier. That point from 82 Hondas, 83 Hondas, 84, those bikes were just...
Yeah. And we all... Everybody still talks about that era of Hondas.
So kind of missed that opportunity. But then I wanted to race in Europe at the time, so it didn't matter what. Just throw me on anything. I'm good to go. Yeah. So, but
you had works bikes over there. So were there Yamaha works bikes?
Yeah, they were works bikes. Yeah. They're full works bikes. And
on paper, 82. Yeah. Okay, here comes this American guy in the Europe. Didn't really know. They saw you ride Lommel, but it's like, I guess he can sort of ride the sand. But 82 on paper, you come in there. George Chobet is reigning world champion, right? And you come over there, and on paper there was a lot of sand tracks. and a guy from Belgium thinking you're going to, an American guy is going to come over and take out the world champion on a bunch of sand tracks is unlikely.
And Belgium tracks.
And
Bourgogne was one really kind of a, actually hard, kind of a hard pack, mucky, muddy, hit with hills up on the side, up and down a hillside.
Right.
And, That was one of the
California boy riding in the mud.
That was Belgium. Was actually a hard track, kind of hard track race. But Holland, Finland, Sweden, all those were sand tracks, and there were four of them, and I think I won all four of them, all four of the sand tracks.
Amazing.
Well, you won
Sweden, Finland.
You won five rounds that year, and four of them were in a row.
Right. Yeah, and I think Holland. No, the first one I won was in France. Actually, was a hard track.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, I got to give my credit. I can ride on a hard track a little bit.
No, yeah, I say a California boy, but yeah, you got to deal with the mud and you got to deal with the sand and and all the borders and the travel and the different currencies. Yeah.
And then I just started. Then luckily, they did. Then there was, I think, Holland was the next track, I think, that I rode in the sand. And Holland's, it's, you know, riding in Holland. So they have, between classes, they have side hacks. And these side hacks
still
no, back in the they still it's really big in Holland, the side sidecar events.
I think they're in Germany,
but if you've ever ridden on a track in a sand with a sidecar track, every turn there's two deep grooves.
Okay.
It's like
a quad track.
It's like racing a quad track. It's like
and they're both like, you know, 2 feet deep, right? And they're bottomless. And there's two grooves grooves all the way around the track, and it's, and they don't touch the track, you know. See, I had never ridden on a so you go after a sidecar event. They grade the start area, you know, a couple turns like they do here anywhere. But once you're on the track, now you're going, holy shit, I just dropped into this rut that was up to my radiators, right? And I just almost went over the bars. So then you learn to go out and cross.
The old mud trick.
So you have to go out, and I didn't even know how to do this. California. Yeah. So right away, you learn how to. No, I was learning actually international races, a little bit like that, you know. Yeah. So you just have to go out. Every turn, you have to kind of create your own lines across all these deep ruts. And then it starts filling in, and it gets better as it goes on. But anyway, so that was my.
I've always thought GPs make a more well-rounded rider than what we have going on here, because here, all of our national tracks are kind of prepped, very similar.
Yeah.
They're very jumpy. And then we have Supercross, which is our main focus. So you get riders that are used to just one type of traction, very good traction all the time, right? I mean, varying degrees, but prepped meticulously.
Agree. Yeah.
And then Supercross.
Yeah.
Where those guys, they don't prep it on Sunday for the motos. You ride Saturday, they pour a bunch of water on it, and good luck. And so you get hard pack. You get deep, deep sand like we don't even have. You know, you get a mixture of mud and God knows whatever else they throw at you. So to win a world title, man, you got to be good in everything. Yeah. You have to be a well-rounded rider.
Yeah, especially back in the days of the GPs when you went to Italy and it was just rock hard and you went to other places. Yeah, it was.
Yeah, yeah. What's the one that Villapoto looped out on?
In Arco.
Arco di Trento.
That looks hard as a rock.
It is. The whole mountain is concrete.
Yeah, it's literally granite.
The floor of the race is concrete. I think they throw dirt on top of it. It's really, it's hard.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's right, and you got these big gnarly rocks that pop up. They just keep growing out of the ground, kind of like Unadilla a little bit.
Yeah. I spent a lot of time on that track when we were developing the KTM because it was right across the Brenner Pass of coming out of Austria. You'd come in, drop into it, and we'd be snowing up at the top of the pass, and they'd come, we haven't had rain here in 114 days. And like, what? It's snowing 20 miles up the road here. Mm. Oh, yeah, we just don't get it here. So, it's interesting.
Yeah.
But 82, one of my favorite photos, and I encourage anybody out there to just Google Danny Laporte images, right? And it's the picture of you and at the final GP when it was pretty obvious you were going to win the world championship. And none other than Heikki Mikkola was shooting you with champagne. And you said it was at Varberg, Sweden.
Vimmerby.
Oh, Vimmerby. Yeah. Sorry. I was in Vimmerby. Varberg was where the Trophy of the Nation was. Vimmerby, and he's shooting you with champagne. And think about having Heikki Mikkola.
Well, did you see him?
I'll never forget. You know, he's at the finish line shaking a bottle.
But he was in this photo. You're coming through a corner, it looks like, and he's shooting you with champagne.
We'll post this picture. It's amazing.
Before the finish, right before the finish.
Exactly.
But, no, it was good. Heikki took a lot of risk, you know, probably with me, you know. And. Yeah. And it's like any what I think, you know, a lot of riders don't realize the what goes into, you know, when a team picks a rider, how much money they invest in them. It's not, you know, it's a big deal. and they have to make way for, like, when I went to Europe, I kind of really probably bumped somebody off of a deal over there, really, to allow me to come on the team. Yep. So, you know, it's not that easy, no matter what the situation. I mean, like, you know, okay, if you're going to be, you know, Tomac is going to be able to find a ride in Europe probably if he wanted to. But, you know, obviously, but still, it's not a guarantee.
No, there's just one or two rider teams, and it's a little, it's definitely, it's. And
There's not a lot of places for riders to go.
Hakey took a big risk on you and for him to come through like that. And I think, we've talked about this before as friends and stuff, but I think, you know, Hakey was one of those guys that was, you know, he was kind of he wasn't the glamorous rider, he wasn't the one that received the most press and all this, but he was as good as anybody in the world championships and to win.
Yeah, he was.
And he was just a solid rider. And so he probably saw you as, here's this American guy that probably has a little lesser chance, and he's not George Obey, the world champion, and blah blah blah. And this is the little train that could a little bit. And Danny was the guy. He took the flyer on Danny Laporte, and the guy comes through first try. I mean, you won the world championship in your first try. I mean,
yeah, that's first. Well, because I went to the Hakey School of Motocross.
Yeah,
Hakey Mikkel. No, he actually kind of got me set. I went to the Helsinki, to the university there, and I was tested and started doing some cross country skiing a little bit. And it was kind of fun, you know, just to kind of, and I went training with Hakey a little bit. He got me doing interval pro, you know, training stuff.
He still trains to this day.
Does he?
He does.
And so cross country skiing.
And bicycling.
And the guy's gnarly.
I got to spin.
And even back then, you know, physically the guy was amazing, you know? So anyway, we were doing all this stuff, and then I got to tell a really quick story, Hakey Mikkel. So he goes, we went hunting, and so we went to this. I thought, okay, we're gonna go hunt. You know, I got a rifle, and we're gonna go walk and go hunt. So we go to this little box. It's like, looks like an outhouse. It's a little bit bigger than an outhouse. It's got a siding thing in the where you stick your rifle out, and there's an open in the middle of the woods. There's just an open field. So they kind of lure the animals in the field. And so you're sitting there drinking vodka and sausages.
I think they call that shooting fish in a barrel.
And coffee peering out this little box waiting for an elk to walk out in the middle of the field. That's hunting. And anyway.
Did you guys get anything?
No. We just drank a lot of
vodka. Yeah, so then, Danny, then after winning that world championship, obviously you're well on your way at that point, and then you come back the following year, got to run with the number one plate finally after all your years. You actually run the number one plate in 83, and at that point right there, it was like, boy, there's no reason for you not to win the championship. And then you had, you know, there was some things that kept you from that.
Yeah, no, actually, we were talking about it earlier, and My first year was kind of like going to be my learning year, kind of to see where I stood, what I had to do to get better, and it just turned out I won. You know, I didn't really expect it at all, but definitely the guy on my side was Joe Bay the whole time, because he is the guy that kind of the needle in my side. Anyway.
Did you guys get along, or what was that?
Yeah, actually, you know, I have to say that we got along. He was actually fun. He was a good guy, you know. But when you're racing, you can't really be that much buddy with people. At the moment, you know, it's not easy to be buddies with a guy you're up against. And there was some tension between us. But then we also, after the races, sometimes we got together, and at the end of the season, we actually became pretty good buddies. So after the championship party in Sweden, we had that night.
Oh yeah,
it was, and then we just really kind of
you're drinking your celebrations. He's drinking his sorrows. But yeah,
I got a picture of Joe Van Eyde actually here.
That's fantastic.
Oh yeah,
both.
You got to send it to me.
Drinking and having some fun. But you know, he was a great guy, and you know, miss the guy a lot because he's such a character and a great competitor and everything. So
the '83 season.
The 83 season was actually my better year, but in this very first race of the season in Chateau du Loir in France, I'm on the start, first turn before this, really, it was really a mud. The race was full deep up to here. I'm kind of actually happy I broke down both motors.
French mud, yeah.
But clay. Literally, there was this one hill I was stressing just even get up the hill. It looked like something out of
like Fox Hills at that one.
Extreme enduros. Graham Jarvis would have, you know, had a tough time going up. I mean, literally, there's 20 guys on this side of this mountain stuck, and they were going back down and going back up, trying to climb this thing.
Oh, my gosh.
It was that hard in practice. So anyway, right before that hill, out of gas. Well, something happened. I didn't know what it was.
Has it out of gas in the first lap or something, right?
Yeah. Went back to the got the bike back to the pits. They took the whole thing apart, everything. They took the engine. They took everything. They couldn't figure out what it was. And it was the stupidest thing, unbelievable. It was a vacuum in the tube of the gas cap. There's a piece of dirt got stuck in the gas cap piece and created a vacuum. And they changed everything on the bike except the gas cap.
So the second motor, same thing.
Oh. So that just cost you there.
So if you so 50 points, you're not gonna, you can't lose 50 points to George Jobe.
Yeah.
So but I did. I actually worked the points down and started winning races again, and I got the points down a bit, you know. So I felt I really did better the second year than I did the first.
So you had a good shot of, had you not DNF'd, let's say you got a 5-10.
Oh, it would have been down to
you to come close.
It'd have been down to the wire.
Close to being back to back world champ. That's amazing.
All right. So after that season, what happened?
This was a really big thing that happened in kind of the whole world. I think it was in the end of 83, the financial kind of things were happening worldwide, and it was really tough on Yamaha at the time. And they were kind of in a battle with Honda and manufacturing, and they kept just hammered down, building bikes, but the bikes weren't going out of the warehouses.
Yeah.
So the warehouses were filling up around the world full of motorcycles, and there were no sales.
Oh.
So Yamaha just said, we have to stop. We can't spend money on these factory bikes anymore. We can't, you know, so that's one of the reasons why the whole thing went from factory bikes to
production. Yeah,
at that time, it was a big, Brock, you know a lot about this point.
And so
for me, it was a big deal because I wanted to, you know, move on to the 500 class. And so the Yamaha wanted me to continue in the 250 class, but I got to get out of here. I'm done.
Okay.
I had two shots at it.
Did you have any?
I had a first and a second. Two times close is way more than I need.
And also, Danny was talking about the 500 class was really, it was kind of the natural progression a little bit. Like, if you looked at Honda's involvement in the Grand Prix, they really only fielded an HRC team in the 500 class. It was, and like Heikki Mikkola winning the 250 championship, he moved up. Håkan Carlqvist, he moved up. And so Yamaha, for certain, the 500 class.
It would have happened that way.
500. But
and it would have probably happened that way.
During that era, do you remember, honestly, like even in America, the older people old enough to remember, we had crazy, like I remember building a house during that time, and prime interest rates for a loan on a house were 14%. And if you borrowed money to build, it was like prime plus 4. And I remember, like you think back, having an interest rate on your home to build a construction loan was 18%, and to refinance your home or to finance your home, you're paying 14% interest. Now you're getting them in the twos, and now it's creeped up to 3.1. I mean, it's just a different time.
Yeah.
And the world economy was just really under stress. And Danny said the manufacturers was like, oh, hold on here for a second here. We're building all these bikes. Nobody's buying them. You know, to finance a bike is expensive, and people just didn't have money.
And Honda at the time could win that battle.
You know?
They had deeper pockets.
They just backed off.
So you jumped to the 500, and it was a
production
YZ 490 base. We have that.
Same bike you rode.
Danny,
bike you were racing.
Danny and Brock in common. Mine was yellow at that 84, and yours was red and white.
Yeah.
Yeah, they weren't very good
but
at that
could you
time,
imagine at that era racing against full fact, you know, so in the America.
HRC Honda.
Yes,
I can imagine, Danny. I can imagine really well.
You know, they had the Hondas, which were still insane, right? That was it. And then they had the Kawasaki's were great bikes. And then the Suzuki's were
fantastic.
They were okay. They were still good. You know, they weren't quite where the Honda and the Kawasaki's were even at the time, but you know, in Europe you have a 500 class. There's not one non-factory, full factory bike in the class, and now we're racing, you know, four modified production bikes, which were okay.
Who was your teammate that year, though? You guys, do you remember?
Well, I didn't really have a teammate. So Håkan Carlqvist and Leif Pearson, went, they created their own team. It was called Lumaca. It was a Yamaha, outside Yamaha, but Yamaha supplied the bikes.
Right.
And then I just stayed with my Yamaha contract.
Which was based in the Netherlands.
Yeah, I tried to do it on my own, basically, which I probably should have. Håkan offered me to be on that Lumaca team because they did have those factory bikes. The full factory bikes.
Yeah. So that's a good.
But I went to say, no, I'm going to stay with Yamaha. It didn't make sense to me in a way, but I kind of should have.
Yeah.
But I didn't. I stayed at Yamaha, and I had a Yamaha truck and a stock Yamaha bike.
Just stock. Nothing. Nope.
Well, no. It was a modified. They had factory forks. They had a factory. We had Olean shock, which worked really well. The Olean's were great. It's a great product. There was no problem. We could, back in those days, you tested 3 days a week. You were shock testing, opening the shock. You spend 8 hours a day on the track. And they'd open the shock. They change the valving. They close the shock. They did everything in the shock. It was not like it is today.
Yeah. It's funny you say that. I actually probably Stig Pettersson was the Olean's guy here. He taught me. I actually to the point where I could do my own shimmy.
Yeah,
that's right. Olean's. That's how bad it was when I got bored watching them do it
too.
So much. I go, teach me how to do this.
Oh,
I'm like bored watching you do it 500 times.
Oh, no, we sit in the truck watching. I did the same thing.
Exactly. Yeah. So here's my question. I'll cross it off the list. I wanted to ask you, at one point in your career, you have to look back and say, God, I made the wrong decision.
It was then.
And it was then.
It was not. Staying with that Yamaha team.
Yeah, he should have gone to the Carlqvist team. Yeah.
I should have. Håkan, they offered me Yamaha, and Håkan offered me the factory. It was that aluminum chassis, that 500 with that flat pipe. It was pretty interesting bike. I don't know really how it performed, but it was you had all the support from on the factory. But they built those bikes and then they stopped, that was it. And those bikes and parts, I see some floating around.
The
some
collectors
of there's
right
not
now.
Many
are,
of those.
Oh yeah, the collector. That's a big time collector bike.
And so I was offered one of those. I said no, I'm going to stay where I was doing. Mm-hmm. And then Leif Pearson got on that team and he was Hogan's backup rider, and so anyway, I start off the championship, and obviously to me, in my mind, when you're riding back in seventh or eighth place or sixth, to me it's like
26.
I'm a loser. I'm a loser.
Yeah.
What am I doing? Yeah. But you look around, the guys are there, good, and they've been riding the 500 class a long time.
Who was leading? Was that Malherbe and Thorpe or what era?
It was Thorpe, Malherbe, Gubors, Jobe was in the 500 class.
And Kurt Nickel.
Nickel was there. So
Kurt would have been just coming out. He was a little young for that, but yeah.
Thorpe. Kurt was just still young, but still.
And the Suzuki guys. You had Jean-Jacques Bruno. Who did you have?
What's his name? The Belgium.
Vromans. Andre Vromans.
Andre Vromans was
And then the Cowie guys. I'm trying to think who was even on the Cowies back in there.
Was Brad still there?
Later, 85, Joe Bay was on a Kawasaki in 85.
Yeah, yeah. Brad actually won and then pretty much retired.
Just called.
He said, I'm out.
He only rode one. He won. Rode one time with the number one plate at Carlsbad GP, and he rode it on a White Brothers Yamaha. And that was that would have been in 1983 because he won the championship 82 and did not renew his contracts and just stopped racing.
Wow.
He was over in Europe a long time, and it was one of the most interesting conversations ever, sitting down with Brad Lackey and his wife, Lori, and a bottle of wine and sitting down for a couple of hours.
He was there nearly 10 years.
Oh, my goodness. Listening to the stories.
Yeah, back in the 70s.
Different 80s. Times. It was not, like I said, it wasn't you plug it into your GPS and cross the. I mean, you're spending hours and hours in a motorhome at the border every time you crossed over every border, and sometimes you crossed over a half a dozen borders going to a GP.
Yeah,
it was not easy.
But anyway, so I made a bad decision there, not maybe sticking with, the plan, Yamaha plan, and using those bikes, because then I would have had a better shot at proving myself. And I got, after the fifth race in Brew, I think it was Brew, then the next race was up, and I actually was in the top, still in the top 10, and at the point, but to me it's like, and it was early on after five races, maybe eighth or whatever, and Håkan had problems, he hurt himself, and then Leif was kind of, it was his first time out there in a 500 class, I can't even remember how he was doing, I think he was doing stellar at the time. And then Yamaha says, I said, look, I can't do this on these stock bikes. I need, because I knew Håkan had hurt himself.
Yeah.
I said, maybe I could get the bikes from Håkan. He's out, right?
Yeah.
And there was no way.
They're just saying
they wouldn't
no.
give up. No, they wouldn't. He wouldn't give up his bikes.
Yeah.
For me, so yeah. I just. They said, "Please go. Keep going." I said, "Nope, I'm done."
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I came back to America. I did some other international events, and then, but luckily, I met my wife.
Yeah, I was about to say you met your wife over there, but that's and you also you did the Bercy Supercross. You were one of the first. That's only myself and David Bailey, Johnny O'Mara, the two Honda guys, and then Rick Johnson and myself.
Oh
and
yeah,
then
that's
you were
right.
The, you were the other American that was over there, the very first Bercy Supercross in '84, I believe.
Yeah, '84.
That's actually when I first time we went to dinner with Georgia, and that was the first time I met your wife there.
Now, this is an interesting story to me because your wife, when you met her, she's French, right? From Paris,
right?
Were you living in Paris for that year? Or where were you living?
No.
Still in Belgium?
In 80, when I met Georgia, I was in Belgium, yeah, living in Belgium, yeah.
And she did not speak a word of English?
No.
How
do we communicate?
Well, the language don't go of language of love on
language
you.
Language of love on you.
Avec la main.
Danny actually could, he speaks a little French, he does. Actually, he's lying if he tells you he doesn't, because I've been with him many times and we've gotten by and...
And oh yeah, that was back in the days. Yeah,
yeah. He knows how.
I'm actually learning better now than I did back then when I was living it, because I watch with my wife. We watch French TV soap operas and shows and stuff.
Yeah. So how did that happen? How did you guys meet?
I was at a supercross race in Genova, Italy, and on a Yamaha with Brock. Was I with you when I met Jordan?
You won that night, or at least a guy with Laporte with a jersey won that night.
Yeah. No, wait, actually. I met Georgia the year before.
Oh, okay.
And then that's when we went to run to the race together. That was another. There was two Laportes on the track that night. He lost all of his clothes. Anyway, I gave him all my.
It's worth it. It's a funny quick story. Well, yeah.
So I was at a supercross race in Geneva, and Danny Chandler was there, and you know I can remember. I wasn't on a Honda then. It was '82. No, I was on a Yamaha.
And Giuseppe Longo. Was his first real. Yeah. Venture into promoting.
She got into the pits. She was with her boyfriend, and her boyfriend asked her to go get a jersey for me or a jacket. So she ended
no
up,
way. Yeah. Bad move, guy.
Oh, I know. Bad move. A bad
so
move.
To outbeat another Italian guy, I'm pretty proud of myself.
Yeah, exactly. He's smooth.
Not easy to do.
He worked in the... But Danny,
He's a good-looking guy, too. He's a good-looking guy. He's actually in the movie industry still. He's pretty good guy, actually.
Over there?
Yeah, right, yeah. Over there. Yeah.
So
how do you hit on a girl when you don't speak French? Or did you speak some?
Okay. That's my techniques.
Don't want to give out all his secrets right now. Come on, man.
No, but I don't know. I saw her, and she was standing behind, I think she was between myself and Roger. I was talking to DeCoster, and she was on the other side of him. And I was peeking like this, smiling at her.
Roger, what are you looking at? Exactly.
Don't let Roger see her back then. Jeez, he'd have turned around.
Yeah. So I saw her, and that was it. And then we exchanged numbers, and... I think Gabriel Mazzarola at Alpine Stars, he did some translating for us. And
got tired. She was living in Italy at the time, though. She was, right?
Yeah,
she was living,
yeah,
in,
she was in, living in Torino.
Torino, right.
Yeah, so in Italy.
And we've still gone back many times since then. Danny had many mutual friends. And actually, I think he was a schoolmate of George's, Pino. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they went to school together. And he used to bring us back for a race called the Transbergaro. And it's still an incredibly fun event. And unfortunately, we just lost him from COVID. Just about a few months back, and it's been a terrible loss for both of us. We really enjoyed his friendship, but
Mickey used to go to that with
Mickey won one of the years.
Dubok
went recently, but it's been Chuck Sun's been kind of lifer. Brad Lackey's been he's our team manager, and he's gone every year. And Danny and we just had a wonderful time on this stuff. And even Robbie Rainer went kind of recently, John Dowd, there's been many Americans. Rick Johnson's gone in the past, Lachine and Marty Smith, the funny story about what Danny was talking about is that I flew into Italy and we're going to the races, and Danny comes picks me up with Georgia at the airport.
That's a great story.
Small little tiny car, you know. I got a big old American riding gear bag. I'm going to run like 8 or 9 European Supercrosses in a row over there in about a 3-week window. So Danny picks me up, and you know, it's a little tiny car. Throw the bag in there, barely fit in there. All three of us in there. We go, let's go get some dinner, you know. And so we pulled over, and Danny parked in the car, and George is like, Danny, you know, like we literally started walking 50 yards away to the restaurant.
Not even that.
And we get into the front entryway to go. You know, there's three of us for dinner. Can we have a table? You know, about that. You know, tell the reception. And then George says, Danny, I think you should go get Brock's gear. You know, I don't think we should leave it in the car. And it's like, I'm thinking, what? Like, yeah, I don't think we should leave it in the car because, you know, I mean, there's a lot of car people breaking into cars. So, because I had seen people carrying the stereos like a shoulder bag. I'm like, where are they doing these portable stereos? And they go, oh, yeah, they break into cars all the time. So she says to go get the bag. Danny, and I'm like, who's going to go? Oh, Danny said, I'll go get it. Okay. And then Danny comes walking back. And he has this, like, look on his face, like, only your friend could do screw with you. Oh, it's too late. It's gone. And I'm like, oh, shut up. You know, like, it's not even funny, dude. We've been gone literally a minute. There's no freaking way. I mean, I knew he was jerking my chain, right? And I say, he goes, no, I'm serious. And then he had that look on his face, like, I know you pretty well. It does. That's not the look. And we go back there. I swear to you, David, the car window's bashed in. My gear's gone. And we see there's a stairway down to like a lower street level. And those guys, within 1 minute of being parked, they had all my riding gear. Yeah. And I raced in Danny Laporte's backup gear. And I think his feet are a little smaller. I remember squeezing into this size nine boot or something when I wear an 11. And I'm like, okay. And I'm like, my jersey had Laporte on it and everything. So, and I ended up winning that. Yeah. And it was kind of funny. So Danny did really well.
You won.
Yeah, Danny won. Yeah. So it was very, yeah. So that was our, like all the crazy, we could write a book about
that. I looped out on the start. my throttle stuck, and there's a big berm turn.
Oh, my bike doing. We had some funny stories, but that was just one of many.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right. Well, I want to get back into it. We're going to take a quick break. I got to pee. I don't know about you guys. hang in there. We're going to be right back with more Danny Laporte.
Dunlop. There is a reason every AMA championship in the past decade was won on Dunlop tires. They are the best. Choose the best performing tire and brand that has never wavered in their support of our sport. Choose Dunlop. Pro Circuit. Pro Circuit products are designed with one goal in mind, winning. Through passion and hard work, Pro Circuit has operated the most successful 250 team in the history of the sport. They use that same formula when developing exhaust, engine, and suspension parts for every brand, when only the highest level of performance is acceptable. Trust Pro Circuit.
Since 2009, Seat Concepts has been dedicated to making the best aftermarket seats. More comfort, more grip, more riding. For 10 years, we've continued to raise the bar. Innovation and American craftsmanship make Seat Concepts the world-leading manufacturer of power sports seats.
At Nihilo Concepts, we have a passion for innovation and for motocross. Our mission is to develop parts that will improve the durability, functionality, and the appearance of your motorcycle. We're proud to say that everything from Nihilo is made in the USA in our state-of-the-art manufacturing facility in Stuart, Florida. Whether you race every weekend or you just ride for fun, Nihilo offers high-quality, innovative parts that you just won't find anywhere else. Nihilo offers custom engraved engine covers, one-piece titanium foot pegs, brake tips, internal engine components, specialty tools, frame grip tape, carbon fiber components, and so much more. Check out our website, NihiloConcepts.com, and see for yourself why teams like Red Bull KTM, Rockstar Husqvarna, Troy Lee Designs, and some of the fastest riders in the world choose Nihilo Concepts. NihiloConcepts.com.
It's Specialized Bicycles. Specialized leads the way in the world of bicycling. Whether it's cross-country racing, downhill, e-bikes, enduro, road, gravel, dual slalom, dirt jumping, or all mountain bikes that do it all, Specialized has the perfect ride for you. The brand is synonymous with engineering excellence and innovation that steers the industry. Visit your local Specialized dealer for a test ride and see just how good Specialized products are. Ogio Power Sports. Ogio has perfected the carrying case, motocross gear bags, helmet bags, boot bags, hydration packs, backpacks, and travel bags, to name a few, have all been meticulously engineered to maximize space and surpass durability standards that would make NASA proud. Simply the best. Ogio Power Sports.
Connected.
I wanted my kids to ride motorcycles, so we would always share that. Besides our family bond, but it's just something cool that you get to share with your kids. I wish I had as a kid was the Cena I've used with Hayden. You turn them on and you can talk to each other. It just changes the whole game. When you're trying to learn and get better, you need that ability to talk to the student. And I think that's what the Cena system does, you know? It allows you to communicate real time instead of saying, oh, come in, hey, that corner there, like 10 laps ago, you did this or that. You know, it's almost like a secret. It's almost like I'd like to even keep it. It's like you want to keep it a secret because it's such an advantage, you know? I feel like the Senna system is such an advantage, and I feel like, you know, it's going to help us elevate Hayden's game big time. So that's why we use it.
With a rich history in motocross, Pro-X has been dedicated to supplying quality components since 1975. Whether you're rebuilding an engine or just need a new chain, Pro-X Racing Parts aims to bridge the gap between OE quality and affordability. Pro-X has over 9,000 part numbers and over 60 different product types that are manufactured by highly reputable or even OEM suppliers and are offered at affordable prices to help keep riders on the bike instead of in the garage. Visit ProX.com to search parts for your bike or check them out at your favorite online or local dealer.
Audio Jungle. The guys are just breaking in their race bikes, which will leave on the semi this Saturday to go to the first Supercross for our coast in Orlando. So the guys are just be goofing off a little bit, do some cool photos, do some cool videos. When you go racing, you want to do well, but a big key is keeping the bikes on the track. That's why we chose to work with Motul.
Expectations coming in as a rookie is just to try and get my feet wet and honestly just send it, see where I end up and do my best out there, but just ride aggressive and ride like myself in practice and I should have a good time.
Challenges of this sport, I believe, is just simply staying healthy. With how fast we're going and what we're doing, your margin for mistake is really, really small.
If you have little rippers, you have had to have seen Stay Sick Bikes by now. We have created bikes and experiences that allow kids to develop sooner and empower them to define their own ride. From learning to ride to sharpening skills, the Stay Sick promise is accelerated growth. Whatever path your family chooses, it's going to be the ride of your life. Stay Sick Stability Cycles.
I'm on vacation every single day because I love my occupation. Hey, I'm on vacation. If you don't like your life, then you should go and change it.
Welcome back, folks. That was your Troily Designs timeout. Get over to troilydesigns.com and look at all the new things they've got going on. I want to mention their camo overload gear. You may have seen Barsha and the boys running this in recent races. This stuff is limited edition. It's going to sell out. Going to sell it quick. So get over and check it out. It's going to be here Wednesday. It's 1st of April. It's out, and it is really cool-looking stuff. Check that out if you guys are in the market for some cool-looking new gear. This stuff looks great. It's awesome. The paint department's firing. All the mountain bike stuff is in and new. So get over to TroilyDesigns.com and check it out. We appreciate their support. Danny, jumping back in here. Okay, so Europe, you're kind of wrapping up over there. After that last year, you, mid-season, you're just like, I'm done. I'm tired of taking a knife to a gunfight.
Yeah, and I definitely, I was saying earlier, I had a little regret of doing that because I really would have liked to have had a few years at the 500 class, you know. But at that point, you know, it just seemed like it was, I just kind of, okay, I did everything I kind of wanted to do. And to keep going now, I'm 29 years old now, 28, 29. And I'm thinking, okay, do I want to, you know, spend another 2 or 3 more years, you know? Mm-hmm. It just didn't make sense to me. So I thought it'd be time to kind of move on. And I came back to America, and Mark Blackwell had contacted me, and he said, hey, Danny, what are you doing? And I'd, not much. So I told him what was happening. He goes, well, I'm putting together a program with Husqvarna. Autolite was a sponsorship, and we needed someone to start testing the Husqvarna motorcycles. They had a plan to kind of bring it back and the brand. So myself and Mickey Diamond, they hired both of us, and spent a lot of time in Sweden, going back and forth and testing and doing some testing out here as well, and in California, all over the place. And so the bike was kind of coming along, and they wanted us to start doing the Supercross series, and I don't know how many races I did with in the Supercross, not too many, but so then I did a little Supercross, and then mainly was going to be the outdoor nationals. I think I just did a few Supercross, and then I was going to do outdoor nationals. And that was the main thing. That is, like I said before, that's kind of really what I was focused on. And
did you still hate Supercross doing those few? Were you like, I hate this?
No, actually, I have to say, coming back, I kind of liked it. It was kind of weird, but you know, it was like new again because you know, it's like, okay, I forgot how to do this, right? Yeah. Everything's, you know, and everyone's gotten better and better at Supercross, so it was really hard to kind of pick up my level and to even get close to what the guys were doing. But so anyway, I knew the main thing was, you know, it was a good excuse if you're not going to win on a Husqvarna, you had a pretty good excuse at the time. So, but
a Swedish,
but it's not fun.
Inside,
I still like to win. I mean, there's no matter what, you're always going to think of, okay, I gotta get myself up there, right? That's where you want to be, not down here. So no matter what you ride, but but anyway, at the, to make a long story short, I did some races in Europe, one in Sweden, one in Finland. I came back to America. My son was born, and I was actually on the plane. My wife was in the hospital in Palm Springs, and I drove. And by the time I got there, she already had my son Shane. So
that was a
great thing. So we ended up going up to back up to Idaho, where I had a house in Ketchum, Brock's stomping grounds as well. Mm-hmm. And went to a national in Colorado, and I crashed, broke my femur. I was practicing, playing around, doing a big giant road jump on a 500, and you know, just goofing around. Found this, you know, flat downhill, across the canyon, road, hillside. Oh, I can do that, right? And I hit the face of on the upside of the road, and the bike went into neutral.
Oh.
I was in fourth gear, wide open. Plastered myself on the top side, upside down. Mm-hmm. Broke my femur. I was laying on my leg. My femur was back. My foot was over here.
You crumbled and fell down the hill?
No, I just plastered against the side. I was high enough. I kind of hit some flat. I did hit some flat area.
We've seen cartoons where something like that.
I was
like
just thinking the Roadrunner.
The Roadrunner cartoon, but they seem to, for some reason, walk away. But
peel you off the wall.
So you were stuck out on the side of a hillside.
Yeah.
Ow.
Idaho.
But it was really good, because actually, in one way, and Georgia always reminds me, because I was so wide open in my life, you know, traveling like we all are, and I had my son just a few weeks before that happened, and I got to spend a lot of time with my son, so it was really great, good memory.
But that year, I mean, in 85, that was the year I think I won the 500 championship. Yeah, it's you had some decent top five finishes there. I think Mount Morris, you were fifth overall, and then you had your best finish fourth at was it the Six Flags?
Six
track
Flags,
or something.
Yeah, yeah,
fourth overall.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
impressive.
I know. I'm happy to hear that.
Yeah,
because it's a little bit of a nightmare, you know, when you think
yeah,
back.
Yeah.
But no, I know I had a couple good decent finishes, and that was okay on that bike, you know,
yeah,
and
yeah,
and it was, you know, it was just part of development things and everything. But yeah, it was like I remember that I did. I think I got lapped every time riding that bike.
Well, you actually in the record
yeah,
books.
Yeah, let's hear
this. That was fourth at the Six Flags race. It was Atlanta, right?
Yeah,
outside of
Atlanta. Yeah, exactly.
That was the best finish on a Husqvarna until 2015 when Jason Anderson scored a podium.
Think about that.
Oh, good. We have something in common. Kind of.
That's pretty cool. I mean, it's one of those little record
30
book
years,
things,
but that's 30 years. That's a,
yeah,
that's a long
yeah,
time.
That is pretty something. You know, it was really... We had a lot of, you know, at the time, the brand even back then had a lot of history.
Oh, of course,
so,
yeah,
you know, they had some of the greatest bikes in the 70s during
mm-hmm,
that time,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and then they just disappeared. So we all kind of had the spirit of trying to, you know, actually, if they really wanted to bring the bike back, that it would be kind of, it was thought it was a good thing. It was ended my career pretty much. So,
how off was that thing from the factory Hondas?
Oh,
I mean, the 85
well,
factory Hondas.
They're just heavy. You know, the yeah, bikes were really, really heavy, and probably heavy and not enough power kind of makes them really heavy, you know?
Makes them not
kinda,
handle well, and
yeah,
then they
well,
don't stop
just,
very
you know,
well.
You know, just getting a little bit more, coming out of a turn to get up and get up over something, it's just a little bit harder to get going, get over something, you know? And then also just in a straightaway, you know, you're just working extra hard. So weight makes a big difference.
I'm not letting him get away with this, okay? He
yeah,
brought up Idaho, and he brought up being up there with Georgia and his femur. And I don't, you know, you can use the femur as an excuse here.
Right.
But I used to use, you know, our house in Idaho as a training for the Colorado Nationals and some of the elevation went. So I swung by to say hi to Danny up in Idaho there and Georgia and Danny and see the new baby and all that. And then you had a couple of dogs, if I remember, back in 85.
Yeah.
And what were the names of those two dogs that you had in 85, Danny?
My favorite two riders, Brock and Joe Bay.
His dog. He starts to call Bwok, and Georgia still had a
my
pretty heavier accent back. Bwok. Like, what? I turn around, and she's talking to the dog. And I'm like, I don't know if this is an insult or a compliment. I don't know. So
I always liked the name Brock.
Yeah, so he had Brock and Joe Bay.
How do you feel about Bwok?
Bwok.
Yeah.
He's
yeah,
a Bwok.
But Brock and Joe Bay were Danny's two dogs, and I'm like, okay, this is okay. I'm just going to leave it at
still
that.
Still don't know where you sit with
us,
do
you?
No,
this
no,
day.
But I think that was great, right?
Yeah, I got it. I oh, boy.
Because he's in your head big time.
Yeah, well.
And he's not going to give you one now.
Exactly.
I think it's
yeah,
great.
Yeah. He names his dog. Okay, okay.
Now, I might have been pissed at you at the time when I named him Brock.
I don't know.
I don't know.
Actually,
no. Revenge.
Yeah, well, all I tell you is that dog peed on – I hope he peed on your wheels every day.
All right, oh, so funny. You – After that season, you had an interest. You actually developed this interest for rally racing while you were in Europe, huh? Seeing it on TV.
Oh, yeah, good thing. That and soccer.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, no, actually, you know, 82, 83, you know, the rallies were getting so big. It was a national, you know, I mean, it was like bigger than motocross.
Mm-hmm.
It was kind of, you had the Tour de France, you had soccer, and then you had, at the end of the year, you had Dakar.
Yeah.
It was huge,
yeah,
and it was literally on. It'd be equivalent of CBS and NBC at the time, which,
yeah,
you know, back then there was only those two channels really for sports, and it was televised every night for 2 hours on mainstream,
yeah,
you know, TV. That's what everybody watched. So everybody followed it. And every time come home, watch Gaston Ryer on his BMW and
yeah, Peter Hansel, Stephen Peter Hansel,
and then,
Jean-Claude Olivier.
Peter Hansel came a little bit
yeah,
later.
Yeah, Jean-Claude Olivier and the Yamaha.
Jean-Claude Olivier, yeah, the yeah, Yamaha team.
Yeah.
And we all knew Jean-Claude Olivier because he was the importer for Yamaha.
Mm-hmm.
He actually raced, and then he actually had a team as well. So he had, you know, a team, and he was participating himself. So, but I'd watch it, and I kept seeing all these guys, you know, you see, and the sponsorships, you'd see Marlboro, Rothmans,
Lucky Strike,
Camel,
yeah,
Lucky
yeah,
Strike,
yeah,
Porsche, Playboy, you know, all these
yeah,
big,
yeah,
all these
yeah,
big sponsors, and thinking, well, us motocrossers are still scrambling to keep, you know, yeah, little, these, we don't even have these sponsors actually
yeah,
on the
yeah,
teams. They were sponsors of series and things like that. So, So in my little mind, I'm thinking, you know what, there could be something here. So I started checking out, asking some of the riders, and I found out they were actually doing really well, making money. And Gaston had switched from motocross over to rallies. And so when I got back to America in 87, Mark Johnson at Kawasaki said, "Hey, Danny, would you think about riding some Baja events?" I go, "Oh, that'd be great, perfect. If I want to get some experience, you know, to go to
because you asked around about it, didn't they say you need some experience?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I did ask around, and they said, "No, you're a motocross guy. You need some experience. Yeah. We've had some, you know, bad experience with motocrossers getting hurt, and one of them was Andre Malherbe."
Really? And, what happened to him?
Well, he crashed and he's been paralyzed since 86.
He got hurt in a rally?
Right.
Yeah, parsed a car.
It was actually in a smaller rally in Tunisia.
Oh, I thought he was in Paris.
But it was okay. Right, but yeah. They have Morocco, Tunisia, right. Egypt, the Pharaoh's rally, and then Dakar. So there were like two small ones, one big one, which is the Pharaoh's, and then Paris to Dakar. Anyway, so at the time, anyway, they're a little bit different. And I kept thinking, how am I going to get on a team over there? So I came back to America, get some experience, and I teamed up with Larry Rossler, Ted Honeycutt, Paul Krause. So we all, you know, three-man team, and we started winning Baja. So every year we won the 1,000, we won the 500, we won the 1,000, we won the 500. 3 years in a row, I kept calling back in Europe, calling Jean-Claude Olivier. "Hey, Jean-Claude, give me a shot at..."
I'm one-time Baja champion. Now I'm two-time Baja 1,000 champion. Now I'm three-time Baja 1,000.
Yeah, 3 years have gone
by. Are you
going
to tell me
right?
I don't know how to ride off-road?
Right, I'm learning how to off-road, right?
Yeah.
And so... anyway, I had a great time riding that. From motocross to the off-road, the riders, the people are just so different. You know, they're so down-to-earth, great guy. You know, motocross is intense. There's it's really a lot of ego, right? A lot of characters and things in a small area. Where, you know, and it's a whole different ball game. But riding is kind of, you know, rallies, you're out alone, really. You're really riding against yourself. You're not really...
Yeah.
Battling shoulder to shoulder and knocking guys off the trail. So that does happen a little bit.
What about your Baja's experience? I mean, you're on a KX500, I assume.
Yeah, that was awesome. Mark Johnson was the team manager at the time, and he developed a great, great winning team there for many years at Kawasaki, and it was a lot of fun. So coming from motocross, I got involved in doing the testing, which was really fun because I had a lot of experience, and so I kind of helped a little bit with power, motor, suspension setup. But it was a lot of fun. So,
any sketchy moments down there in Mexico?
You know, it's like, you know.
There's always a sketchy moment down there.
I think everyone's got a story.
Scott Hardin, great. Yeah. Well, everyone knows Scott Hardin, one of the greatest off-road riders of all time. And he said to me, it's really funny. It's like racing in Baja, racing in the desert, it's like racing a train crash. Whatever. Yeah. It's always
going to be a train wreck somewhere.
Yeah, it's just constant. You know, you have to learn how to scan, look farther out in front of you. You know, we're in motocross, we look, you know, 50 feet, 100 feet. Yeah. There you got to look out a little bit farther for rocks and ditches and things. And then all of a sudden you're airborne, or you hit a rock you don't see in a sand wash and you're airborne. And I have a really quick story. One time I was in Africa and I was going to, the night before the briefing, they said, "Do not get on the railroads, on the railroad track. You're going to be paralleling a railroad for like 100 miles. So, okay, so no problem. And that morning I had to change a wheel, so it was a marathon night, so I'm losing time as I'm changing the wheel, so I lost time, so maybe 3 or 4 minutes. And it was still early in the rally, only 4 or 5 days into it, and I said, "Screw it, I'm getting on the railroad track," because I knew it was faster, right? So these big beasts tried to jump up onto a railroad over the metal, into the metal. You know, these things are, you know, monster 950 motors, the big bikes back then. Get up on the railroad track. I'm wide open down the railroad, just pinball. You're going
100 miles
over
an hour.
100 miles, easy. Yeah. But you're just straight as an arrow, right? And then sometimes there'd be turns in the desert railroad, and you all of a sudden you come up and there's a giant sand dune that you moved over. They kind of shift in the desert, and it looked like the railroad just disappeared into a dune. So you have to jump off, go around, jump back on the railroad track, and then blitz it. I was catching everybody. I know I was way. I might have come in the first.
It's called cheating, right? We're not going to call it that.
So I'm going maybe, I don't know, 100, whatever. Let's say it's 100. Let's say it's 110, maybe 120.
Definitely 100.
All those big bikes are fast.
Yeah, yeah.
So I see a bunch of railroad ties missing in the middle of the railroads. I'm maybe 100 yards out, and I see a gap.
Oh, no.
And this is, you know, this is where motocrossers and off-road riders can see probably better. You know, if I'd seen it, maybe I would have just slowed down and jumped off. And then I see it the last second, and I remember I just tried to do whatever I could to get my – on those bikes, you can't really do anything. Yeah. They're so heavy. And I got to the other side. Wheel was over the other side of the railroad tracks. I'm still in the middle of railroad ties going 100. Clip my rear wheel. Now I'm doing a nose wheelie.
Oh, my gosh.
In the middle of North Africa. No one's around.
Yeah.
So I blew the shock, the hose valve, right off the back of the shock. Hit so hard. It blew, you know, the reservoir. Yeah. They just blew it off. Now I'm slowed the bike down. I made it. I'm just shaking. I'm
Do you have like a whole bunch of shit
life.
In your pants at this point?
You don't want to die in the middle of that.
Oh, God.
I'm boinging down this railroad track like no air, no oil in the shock. I get off the railroad track, and literally 2 miles farther, there's a checkpoint. I pull in, and they said, now here on the radio, someone's on the railroad. They're talking, blah, 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 blah. The French guys, you know, they're talking. And they're asking me, were you on the railroad track? You just came from over there, you know, blah, blah. I go, no. I was acting completely stupid, right? And so I go, no, it's not me. So they're looking around, and I pulled in. I'm like literally back in third. I passed everybody.
Just made up so many minutes.
15, whatever, 20 minutes. There's, I think, a couple. Peter Hansel was probably there. Who knows? Whatever. Anyway, I pull up, and then all of a sudden we hear, because the pit's right next to the railroad, maybe 100 yards from the railroad track. And we hear this, it's a two-stroke. And it's Honda had that development, that bike that's like active radical two-stroke. They developed the 500cc water-cooled thing. Really amazing bike, right? It was like a $500,000 test thing for them or probably more than that. Yeah, I mean, the bike itself was probably that. They were trying to test a new
low emission
two-stroke. Okay. Yeah. I can't remember the name. Active radical bike, whatever it was. And we hear this guy going down the railroad tracks, and with one of the riders, I can't remember, it was Richard Sankt or Brucey at the time. Anyway, he was going down the railroad track, and they're all pointing, there he is.
There he is. That's the guy. We found him. Yeah, that's
You're
him.
Pointing.
And Danny's like, him. Yeah, that's him. Get him. That's cheating.
So I felt bad for those guys because of all the money they spent on that bike and that test anyway.
So let's talk about it. You won the Pharoah's Rally. And right, in Egypt.
Yeah.
You won overall, and that was an accomplishment. Obviously, no American had done up to that point. But you also finished, I think, second in Paris to Dakar, which you're kind of underplaying Paris to Dakar. I remember going over for the Bercy Supercross, and we would always work out of the Yamaha distributor in France there in Paris, and it was Sonato Yamaha. They were the ones who headed up the entire Yamaha Paris to Dakar effort. There was more money spent for that race with works parts, complete full factory bikes and everything, then I think they spent globally in motocross. Mm. I was always like, to me, I was like, wait a minute, we barely get any work stuff, especially at that time in the 80s. We were riding production bikes and these guys had all of Yamaha. I mean, it was shocking the effort that the factory Yamaha in Japan put into that rally with all the works, billet, handmade, crazy parts for that race. And it was, you know, they claim that the French importer paid for it all, which I'm sure they did, but it certainly took up a lot of resources.
They have the cigarette money, all the cigarette companies.
Yeah.
But
Brabeck, we had him on right before, literally a month before he won it.
Yeah, and,
which you were the best finishing American until years ago.
Yeah, Ricky.
Until Ricky.
But his, I thought that was like an RX that they modified around, whatever. That is a handmade like.
Oh, it's crazy.
One-off machine.
Right. No, they're back to factory bikes now.
So,
yeah.
So why? Why in the world? Those things are so heavy. I know you're going fast, but couldn't you gear a CRFX or, an off-road model to carry enough fuel but be so much lighter and nimble?
Well, that's what he's actually riding now. They're 450s. It's a motocross-based bike. And then they add on those fuel tanks now. So they've changed the rules in Dakar, all the rallies, most of them anyway.
Yeah, it's all 450.
So there's no more big twin cylinder bikes.
These guys were riding, like when Gaston won Rayer, he was a multi-time 125 world champion on Suzuki. But then when he went over to rally and he rode BMWs, they were running the big 98.
It's a street bike.
The Boxster giant, motors, basically, those big side-by-side.
With motocross suspension, you know.
Suspension on them with huge fuel tanks and tanks off the rear and the back. These things were... I mean, I don't know how many liters it was, but they're holding probably 15. I mean, how many liters would those things hold? Do you remember?
I think about 60.
Yeah. Think about that. I mean, you're talking
60. So much weight and fuel.
Yeah, in the rear around the engine, but a big 950 in the sand just burns so much gas. You know, so.
And your top speed was, they got to the point where it was crazy. The top speed was 120, 130 miles
an hour. Oh, no. Yeah. They were, I think, you know, I mean, last time I rode a single 1 year in Dakar with Jimmy Lewis and myself.
Right,
last time on a KTM, actually. Uh-huh. And on a six, it was a six, there were 620s, I believe, 640 or 620 at the time, 640.
Yeah.
And top speed were, you know, just over 100. You know, they were really in sand, in dirt.
Hard,
you couldn't really, but the big 950s would go 130, you know, one even more.
That's why people
So it's a whole other, that extra speed, the guys were getting hurt. Yeah. And then, but in Africa, now the race has changed a little bit. It hasn't been in Africa. So Africa has these long, huge, massive spans of, you know, nothing, you know, so where you could be on a road for 100 miles, just flat out, just all, it looks like, you know, it looks like a dry lake, and you're just, you know, you can be just pinned, and then you get in the section of sand, long sand dunes, and then now they've slowed it down deliberately, you know, to kind of, because the bikes are smaller, so they made it a little more it's still fast enough to get hurt, but... You know, and especially you're in the middle of nowhere when that kind of stuff happens. But
Well, and you had a big one. Tell us about it. You showed us a photo. Was that in the Pharoahs?
That was my first ride with Yamaha, Jean-Claude on this team, on the Sonato team at the time. And it was my first experience in Dakar. And
it was Dakar.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so it was about the sixth day, I believe, eighth day. And there was was in Niger what was the name of the town? I can't remember. But anyway, so the next stage in the morning, I got up and took off, and I really don't have any idea what happened because I was out for 2 weeks.
Yeah, medically induced coma for 2 weeks.
Yeah,
right? That's pretty serious stuff.
So, what happened was, they told me anyway, I hit a berm outside of the village, and there was a lot of wind. And when the wind's shifting across, it's blowing really hard. The ground looks like it's moving.
Mm.
It's flat, and I kind of drifted off, and I hit a berm. And a berm built, I think they said it from, you know, outside these villages, they dump trash. So it wasn't a natural bump. It was something built from a tractor.
Jeez. Mm.
So I just hit it, flip, and then had a lung contusion, heart contusion.
Yeah. You obviously had plus
I was KO'd for... a while. So I had some swelling in my
head. So also during that time that you competed in the rally series, there's basically the granddaddy was Paris to Dakar, but there was also three or four major rallies.
They had the Atlas rally in Morocco, Tunisia, the Pharoahs rally. Pharoahs kind of like the mini Dakar.
Yeah, it was like the second.
It was 11 day race, you know, 3,000 miles or something.
So while you're competing that, we had a little unrest, you know, little conflicts here and there in some of those countries in Libya and places that we were going through. So tell us about how you were as an American in an unwelcomed country like Libya. And so
after we bombed Gaddafi.
After we had carpet bombed him. Tell us, like, just that in itself. Luckily for you, Laporte, you could fake like you're French, but passport-wise and all that, to be able to pass through countries like that, and that's part of the reason why now it's out of that region.
You know what happened? It's really funny. It's great stories, because I had just signed a contract to race through Tripoli, and... they weren't giving visas at first. So I had a contract to race. I had to go through Tripoli, Libya, and I was really panicking. So I knew someone. It was a famous Formula One car driver through someone else. It's Jacques Lafitte. I can't. You know who he is, probably. Anyway, so he knows the Minister of Finance in France, who is in Paris, La Défense, in the government. So I get to go have a meeting with him to see if I can get a French passport.
Oh, wow.
This is a great story.
Yeah.
So we go in this guy's, His office is about the size of this whole warehouse, right? And there's a little desk, a little French guy at the end, right?
Jean-Marie.
I am the Minister of Finance.
Yeah.
No.
So if you're in Paris, really nice you see in Paris that La Défense, that like
La Défense.
Yeah. The defense, basically.
It's the defense.
Yeah, it's their, you know, that's their military, you know, their whole department. It'd be like the head of.
I mean, I was blown away just to be able to meet this level already, right? To try to get a French passport the French way, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway, so I'm with Jacques Lafitte. We walk up. He introduced me. We're talking a little bit. And sure enough, because Jacques Lafitte was involved with a Formula One team, Ligier, at the time.
Yeah.
And we get he's watching Formula One on his computer. Yeah, it was in South. I can't remember where it was that weekend. But anyway.
That's funny. So he gave you a French passport?
No, I didn't have to. I didn't have to get one. Okay. So at the end, they let me through. I got my visa, and I didn't have to get a French passport.
Did you ever have any sketchy moments?
But I had a French flag. Instead of having an American, everyone has a little flags in their name.
Yeah.
I had a little French flag next to mine, just in case.
Just incognito. That's where you just like, yeah.
It's a little insurance policy there.
Yeah.
Ever have any sketchy moments there in Africa? I mean, that alone would get my heart rate going, just knowing where I was.
Yeah, actually, I rode all day, pretty much. It was maybe 3 in the afternoon. The stage had ended, and then there was a war had started in Jemena, in this part of Africa, and next to Niger, and they said we can't go through the country. We have to go around this country. So we did a whole stage. Arrive. It's now like 5 o'clock. All the helicopters. Everyone's arriving. The whole in the old Africa, everything followed. There were no roads, there's no highways, you didn't have a camper at night. Now it's kind of like boutique-style rallies, right? So then it was literally everybody slept on the ground.
Traveling caravan, right. You literally slept on the ground underneath a truck.
And your 6x6 vehicles were on the course. And sometimes you didn't even get your gear till midnight, and they didn't show up, right?
Wow. Yeah, I've seen pictures of the old 6x6s we all had
little planes, the team manager, the doctor, the guy, our physiotherapist, who was ever on the plane, or you know, he had all this. He had minimal stuff for us, like a jacket and a few things we could have, and maybe a bag to sleep on. But they were back to my story. So we got to the end of the event that day, and they started a war in Jemena. So they said we have to go around this country. To get to the next day. So we rode all day. We got fuel. And there's a fight. They're saying, we can't do this. It's too dangerous. You know, we can't ride all night long. And then the guy shows up, and the organizer at the time was, what's his name? Hubert Auriol.
Yeah.
And he said, tomorrow morning at, no, actually, no, he wasn't the organizer. He was racing in the race still. I'm sorry. It was the father of the guy who originated the rally, the father of the event. I'm skipping right now anyway. So basically at 5 o'clock he goes, start times tomorrow at 7 o'clock. And if you're not there every minute you're late, you're off. So now you're in the middle of North Africa. There's no road maps or nothing. They said, go here, we'll give you some headings. You ride around the war, get to the start. So literally, I rode all day.
You guys
got on the bike
caravan and together at least?
No.
Every
man for himself, because we wanted to be the first. And one guy fires a bike up. He said, no one's going. There was a big protest.
Oh.
Then some of the guys said, it's too dangerous, right? And I heard a bike start and another bike start. Screw it. So I started, had full tanks. We rode literally all night long to the start the next morning. Got in at like maybe 4 o'clock the next morning. Because, you know, at night in Africa, you're riding through the desert, dunes
slow.
And stuff. It's gnarly. So I came maybe 300 miles. And then we had to get gas. So you had to find a place to find refuel to keep going, get to the start the next morning. And they're there waiting for you to start, you know, at 6:30 to 7 o'clock in the morning. I rode all day, all night. And the next day.
Did you catch any nap at all between 4 and
7? I did maybe between 4 and 7.
Probably not. You didn't, in any part of your time, did you ever think about, I'm just going to ride through that war, so they're not going to be able to, I'm going to be going pretty fast.
Literally. David Trolley, great enduro rider. We stuck together. Exactly. He was my kind of riding buddy at the, all night long. Yeah, yeah. So we stuck together. You know, you're riding through deep powder ruts, rutted roads. One guy would crash, lights go off. Yeah. You can't find your bike. You know, it's pretty gnarly.
You,
you, know, scary.
And you teamed you teamed with David later on in Baja 1000.
Yeah, yeah, for that's Kawasaki. Right. Yeah, we did ride a little.
That's another story that's way too long to tell here.
That was
yeah. You can, the injured, the walking wounded, we, trying to get through
the Baja
1000.
We were late to the start.
Maybe. Yeah, that's a different. I'll tell Don, that one off the air.
Don Emler and I were gabbing away. We missed the turns to get to the start. Anyway,
I was racing. Actually, I raced that race in a truck in the.
So, but anyway, it's just. You know, the stories are great in Africa. I mean, it's part of the story, you know, the things that happen. But and eventually that's why they had to move it out of Africa because of...
It's Brazil now? Is that where they're holding it?
They were in South America. Yeah. It started in its various Argentina, places, in Argentina and over in... they started in Brazil, actually, 1 year, I think, and rode over.
And then Chile.
Yeah. And then... And then I think it was mostly in Chile because there are some deserts there, you know. Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned Don Emler and your lifelong relationship with Donnie and FMF.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah. How did you get connected with Big Donnie?
Well, the first time I ever saw him, he was riding a like some crazy bike I saw over in Gaffey Street.
Zundap, a Pendap or something.
Yeah, no, actually, it was just a stock Zundap or something like that. Yeah.
Zundap.
Yeah, he would take.
Or he always had these odd.
Donnie, yeah, he built Pendaps, which was he'd take a Penton chassis, which was probably one of the best chassis at the time, and he morphed a Zundap motor in it because he loved the Zundap motor because he raced a Zundap, like you said.
Called it a Pendap.
He called it a Pendap, and then other times he had a Honda, it was a Penda.
Penda.
And there's still a few of them floating around. You go to Pro Circuit, talk to Norm Bigelow, he still has a Penda.
Does he?
Yeah, absolutely. He's got a Penda.
And it's the same thing, what Kelvin was doing later on.
Yeah.
You know, basically trying to combine, because there wasn't really any, you know, KTM had a decent chassis.
Yeah.
But it was hard. The shifting was kind of.
Yeah, the Sachs motor didn't shift well, and the Honda motor shifted fantastic.
Well, you guys talk about that era and how it was of this manufacturing and fabbing and trying to make these things better. Yeah. If you were a good machinist or engineer, man, world was your oyster back then. That was probably just where he jumped in, huh?
It was actually fun. And Donnie, Donnie was a darn good rider, and people don't realize how good he is.
Oh, was he?
Yeah.
And these two.
He still rides really well.
These two goofballs, trust me, Dunlop still sponsors these guys out there, and they go climbing around. And they still. Donnie likes the paddle tire. He's like, I want an MX-11, I want an MX-12, or whatever. Yeah, they climbing all the hills, and he uses his paddle tire.
The MX-12's fun. Yeah, it's a good tire.
Oh, yeah. Especially when it's deep sand, dry. Yeah, you know, we go out there, and it was really funny because, you know, there's like. We go up this place. It's a secret place. But Bean Canyon. But it's where I grew up riding, so it's not a secret. I rode there my whole life before most of the guys anyway. Yeah. So since the 60s or whatever, I guess.
And it's still open land.
Oh, huh?
Well, it is kind of, you know, you have to technically own property there to be able to ride out there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is kind of like a riding on the railroad tracks kind of story.
Yeah, exactly.
But
so you guys still
ride. And Donnie rides on the railroad, used to ride on the railroad tracks. He was a railroad track guy from the South Bay. He could ride from one part of LA to the other on railroad tracks.
Yeah.
But
so your long relationship with Donnie.
Yeah. And he's a great rider. We climb a lot, and it's a lot of deep sand, real big long climbs, long. You can, and it's good because you can get the full sensation. You can't do that on a motocross track, turn a 500 full throttle or a 300.
Yeah. It's like a dyno run.
But up a sand hill, you can just all the way to the. The stop and you shift and you have fun and you slow and you get back on the gas. So we do some development testing there too.
Development testing.
Exactly. So
people ask where you're at testing.
Yeah.
So the decision to retire, I guess from both sports, from motocross, or did you kind of go right from moto into off road?
From moto I went. Actually, right into off-road stuff. And I think I did six-day trials 1 year in Germany.
How was that?
89. Pretty good, actually. I got a gold medal.
You did?
Yeah. And I think I actually had a pretty high finishing overall for an American until Caselli, I think, later on. So I did okay. But, you know, it was a really easy... 6 days. It was in Germany. The tracks were really kind of simple, more motocrossy, it wasn't this gnarly mud fest type event, you know. So it was a good way to get broken into. And so that was a really good experience.
You're like the hardest Swiss Army knife.
The hardest thing though is those guys can change off-road riders can change tires and work on their own bikes. Yeah. that's really weird. Yeah.
No, watching those guys throw a tire, it's like same with rally. You guys only get a minute, set amount of time, right?
These guys change front and rear tires in less than 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Now they're getting even with moose.
Yeah,
they can. Crazy. These guys are gnarly. They have a lot of levers and they're strong, and they get it done.
They rip them off.
It's unbelievable to watch these guys change moose tires. And I'm anyway.
Danny's a full renaissance man. He can do everything.
I'm the only guy that ever did the 6 days, got a gold medal, never changed his tires.
Never changed the darn tire. Like,
no, I did. I changed. Oh. I'm joking. I only did the front tire twice, and I did
would wheelie a lot because I ain't changing that thing again. Forget it.
Yeah. I learned my lesson. I changed my riding style.
Yeah, trust me. Danny was always prepared for like kind of any everything, and I have millions of fun stories of doing photo shoots with him at JT and all that stuff. And any given time he'd show up down there because it was my hometown. It was not far from my house, but I'd show up. Danny would have to make a little bit of a trek down there and just open up the back of Danny's van. I'd do it just every time just to get a peek in there. And he's got, I mean, honestly, at any given moment, I think Danny could live a week out of his van. He had a bike in there. He had clothes. He had riding gear. He had everything. He's like a sleeping bag. He's got, 5 gallon gas. Oh, what? 5 gallons of water. He's got everything you need. Like he was always
ready
for
that. Was my dad. He's done.
I know he's ready for
the
adventure. Is that your dad?
Yeah, that's my dad. Ranger. Always prepared. Yeah,
yeah. He was always prepared. I thought it was the coolest thing, and I tease him a little bit. But I want to see what's in your van this week, And it was just, he was thinking about it.
Hey, but Baja one time was doing the start. I think it was 500, or maybe meant 400. Anyway, Mark Johnson were on the start line. He goes, Laporte, you have to wear a fanny pack. You need tools. I go, well, what am I going to do with those?
Exactly. I wouldn't know. Righty tighty, lefty. What is that?
Just wrench it off. I'm not going to take my engine out. If I break down, it's over.
Yeah. I'm calling you this little radio right here.
So he runs up and he. I took it off before the start. He didn't see me. And he runs up and he puts it on around my waist again, right? And then. Right in the start, they're, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 type deal, go.
Just click the button.
I hit the button and I left the fanny pack. It fell off the back of the fender. Oh, it was pretty funny.
You'd be like, man, you didn't tighten it all the way. It must not have
clipped.
So after you got the second in the Paris to Dakar rally, did you kind of say, all right, I'm good, I'm done?
No.
Or did you try to, were you wanting to continue on? And
yeah, no, I actually wanted to because I had gotten second and... so I kind of thought I had to keep going. But what happened was, at the time, right when that had happened, I had like three years of experience racing the rallies. Then all the cigarette sponsors dried up. They're gone literally overnight, with
it
all
the became illegal.
There's no more, they didn't want to see the logo. They passed new laws, no TV, Formula One. Everybody kind of went through it. Some of them kind of cheated a little bit. They took the name off of Marlboro. You see this insignia.
Well, you look
and
at,
then they took Lucky and then they took off the word, which you saw that was also doomed as well. So it's kind of like right now in motocross, if they took away all the energy drinks tomorrow, what would happen to
Danny,
our sport?
Danny, do you remember back in, if you really looked at the GPs, the road racing GPs, when you look at the Kenny Roberts, or just after that, but the Eddie Lawson, the Wayne Rainey, that era, the Kevin Schwantzes, when they were sponsored from Marlboro and they were also sponsored, different countries had different laws too. So like if you could race a you could go to one country, maybe Sweden, and you couldn't have any cigarettes. So they would have all the colors, but just out the word. And then they'd show up the next week. You'd see a photo from Italy, and there'd be all the names of the companies or whatever it is. Right. So it got really harder. And then as the European Union sort of started to develop, or just the organization of it, where cigarettes became, like this is taboo. You can't advertise in it. And then it got more and more to where the cigarette companies like this is not worth our money anymore.
It was really a bummer.
Yeah. And the rallies were part of that too. Cause Lucky Strike was Gaston Reyer, the BMW program and all that was all a Lucky Strike deal. And then Sonato had the Galois, the French brand of cigarettes.
Gouaz. Kajiva had Lucky Strike. Lucky. And then Yamaha Gouaz.
So,
isn't there a MotoGP team that's still sponsored by them or?
There are, I don't know how they do it, how they get away with it now. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if the things change or not, but you don't see any more really.
It's tough, right? Because you get it. We don't want to make those look cool to kids.
Yeah.
But that's a lot of money.
Marlboro still supports Ducati. They're the only cigarette manufacturer left in MotoGP.
Oh, really? Right? Yeah. They still do.
Yeah, but it's they have this really weird thing where they've got the way they brand it. Mm-hmm. It you, unless you were like into Marlboro, you'd never know.
Mm. Well,
yeah.
Interesting. So, all right, so that took the so fun, the money
that,
just sort of
that took the fun out of it. Yeah, and it really it really kind of became like almost it kind of almost disappeared.
Yeah.
You know, because the riders that were, you know, and it's picked up. It's gotten better and better over the years. You know, and they've tried to reduce the cost without the cigarette sponsors and everything. It's just the cost to do a real Dakar. Like, you know, you have to have you have to have your own planes. Your own.
Oh, it's insane.
You know, six of these. You have to have, you know, four 6-wheel drive. Those big giant military vehicles,
multi-million-dollar vehicles packed full of just, spare parts.
Right,
and yeah, it's crazy.
I mean, it's so, really huge. Yeah, the amount
it just
cost.
Priced itself out of the
logistics
game.
Are really big. It's like a military type thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm. Out of all the disciplines you raced, what would you say is the toughest?
The toughest race?
I mean, of motocross, supercross, GP. Baja. Rally, Baja, you know, you've done all of these things,
you know,
ISDE.
I think no matter what you do, they're all there. If you want to reach the top, it's tough. There's no easy way, you know.
None of them are easy. Yeah, yeah.
And but physically, motocross is by far the most difficult. Yeah. I mean, the intensity in the I mean, Brock, you know, I've seen Brock and myself on our knees more than once, you know.
Oh, steady.
And yourself
there, guys.
As well, you know. It's like, you know, you come off, get peeled off the bike. And, yeah. You know, oh, yeah. When there were 45-minute motos before as well, and you're in the south in the summer racing when it's 100, you know, 90 degrees. And
I rode one of Mitch's bikes straight down into the creek at Millville after the second moto 1 year. Yeah. Yeah. I was going to pass out if I didn't get cooled off right now.
Yeah. And even, but even now, even the motors are shorter, but then you ride, your intensity level is higher.
Yeah.
It's all relative. Yeah, exactly. You just put it out. I mean, it's intensity wise. Yeah. It's got to be one of the toughest. You're maxed out. You have no more, you can't get enough air to your body to fix the muscles, to fix your problem.
Yeah.
You just, there's no way.
At least on a motocross track, I know for the most part what's coming around. I know lines change. Maybe there's a guy down, but when you're doing 100+ across the desert or through Baja, that just seems like
it's a fear factor too. You know, the that's a hard thing to deal with every day, trying to get up in the morning.
Yeah,
and a guy, you know, so you're second, and I remember this Italian guy says he's a kind of assistant team manager, and not the team manager at Ducati. His name was Otzeline Roberto, and his son runs a team at Sherco now. Another Otzeline, anyway, his son. But the assistant manager says, "Danny, today you have to really turn the gas." I'm all look at this guy.
You're like, thank you.
Here's my helmet. Exactly. Here's my helmet.
Yeah, here's. Yeah, right. Okay. I think I'm trying as hard as I can.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
You're not going to find anyone who's not going to risk. You're out. It is nutty. It is nutty because you're going, you get tired after 4 or 5 hours going 100+. And you get complacent. You're spacing yourself out. Here you're going, and then all of a sudden you're in the air. You know, you find yourself sleeping at the wheel, and then you got a little ravine that you're flying over, and you just go, oh my God, and then you make it. You know, so it's kind of that every day you have to deal with that, getting up every day and going those speeds. You're it's not physically as tiring, but mentally it's much
exhausting.
It's tough too.
In Baja, at least in Baja, mostly you're pre-running, and you honestly, as crazy it is, especially if you're a 2 or 3 rider team, you've pre-run your section enough to know where it's at. It's almost
kind of what's going on.
You
do, but then you still have that one rock.
Oh,
here
I tell you, the rocks that stirred up by a truck.
And
or
unfortunately,
something.
A cow, a vehicle, a cow.
Yeah,
unfortunately,
anything. Yeah, there's a lot to that one too. But it's at least you have sometimes of it. You have an idea where you're going. You're not following what used to be a route map, rolling map. Now it's all electronic, but still, it's gnarly navigating.
Well, Johnny Campbell shared a story where he was riding down there, got held up at gunpoint. They told him to strip out of all of his gear, and he sent him walking down the road.
Mm-hmm.
And then they stole the crap they wanted to steal and took off, left his bike there, so he was able to ride back. But
during pre-running, right? I think probably.
No, there was no pre-running in Africa.
No, this was in Baja.
Oh, I heard about this story. You're right. Yeah,
probably, was it not pre-running? It was actually doing the race.
I don't want to misspeak.
I'm going to call him on the way home. Johnny.
Okay, oh, gotcha. It's a crazy story. Oh, yeah, but I just, that's the kind of wild shit that goes on down there. And I just think, man, I'm out.
I'm with you. It's not worth it.
I've heard enough of those stories. I'm like, I don't need to ride in Mexico.
When I was 2 weeks in a medical-induced coma at a rally, I'd be out too.
I know. I can't believe I came back and raced the next year.
I know.
But that, you know, it's kind of like anything. We crash. Motocross desert racers, they get up.
No,
they do
2 weeks
again.
In a medically-induced coma, it's not like anything else.
No,
okay?
I don't know.
Hey, can I ask I want to ask a question about the fitness thing. I know that, you know, I don't want to sound like the old guys when I'm back in our day, but the bikes are better now, better suspension. The motors are shorter. The equipment itself, I mean, it breathes better now, everything else. Do you feel, and even the fitness level of these riders is, you know, these guys are like training like Tour de France riders to a certain degree. Do you think it was harder physically back in your day than it is today?
I don't know. Probably on the body, you know, the suspension itself was, you know, you'd bottom quite more often at a really high speed G-force, you get this shot up your back through your back that, you know, you know how that is. That's kind of, so it's maybe harder on your body, but physically I think, you know, it's all relative. I think you, now that everything's better, you just ride at a little bit higher level and you're just pushing yourself. So there's no limit, I don't think, no matter how great the bikes or how the tracks, you'll still need the conditioning level as you did before. It's just like, I think maybe the bikes are a little maybe forgiving on the big G outs, you know,
and the vibration level,
the old 500 is vibrated and I've got some arthritis in my joints from my wrists, you know, because you white knuckle the 500s, you know, so you have some things there, but I think there's no excuse what kind of level of conditioning you should be in, you know. And I don't care if you drive a Formula, sitting in a car, you have to train really hard because the better condition you're in, the better you're going to do. So I don't think
we ran heart monitors on us back in the day of a Supercross race, our heart monitor, we were running as close to max as the guys are now. I mean, it's. I think it's all. I mean, you just go as hard as you possibly can, and
with that vehicle, with
whatever you're riding and what you had physically at the time. And I think the knowledge of, you know, training right now is much higher than we had. But our era was kind of the first really. We pushed pretty hard training. I mean, it was. Yeah. I think we pushed as hard as we knew how to at the time.
I think maybe you can. We couldn't. I think today you can't outride the bike. Mm-hmm. Because the bike's limits are higher. I think we could kind of push the bikes to their where they're capable of.
Yeah.
And then that was physically probably harder.
Your natural rib.
Part. Yeah. But I don't think today someone could ride a bike at its full potential.
I don't either. Not a 450.
No, not even. Because even back when we were doing it, a lot of times it was hard to ride the bike to its full potential.
Yeah, yeah.
So now it would be impossible because the bikes are.
We had Steve Caballero on the show last week, and just throw this in because I think this was interesting. We were talking about progression of the sport, any sport, like just action sports in general. Yeah. And he said in 1980, think about where skating was in 1980. I mean, not even anything like what it is now. He goes, I was looking at what we were doing and I thought, there's no way we can do, like, no one's going to be able to do anything more than this.
Yeah.
And I thought, really? In 1980? And then look at, I mean, now that they're doing 900s and flip, you know, think of how crazy it's gotten.
How about flipping a motocross bike?
Yeah. So it's the same thing, right? Yeah, like, exactly. I think that's crazy that they thought that in 1980. And here now, if you went, how do guys go faster?
Hey, I mean,
I don't think it's possible, but of course it is.
I see it every week. I mean, I go to every single Supercross for Dunlop, and I, like last race in Arlington, you know, the top five guys particularly, because you couldn't watch the whole track, but they are just, you know, especially when Kenny and Webb and Tomac were going at it, these guys are unbelievable right now. They're unbelievable. And I think the same type of person obviously gets to the top of their sport in all generations. So it's really hard to, you know, compare eras. But what they're doing right now on a motorcycle, they're talented. But one generation just kind of raises the bar, and the next one, you know, there's that old, you know, motivational speaking tool that people use. They usually grab somebody out of the audience and they say, hey, or stand right here. Okay, now I want you to, you know, do a standing jump and see how far you can go. And then they, as soon as they jump out there, you know, they just mark a spot and they go, I want you to do that again. You know, 95% of the time the person's going to beat the mark because they know that's the mark I've got to beat. Well, it was kind of the same thing. Everybody asked back in the day when we grew up, it was like, well, you know, who do I have to beat to be good? Well, I got to beat Marty Smith, Danny Laporte, whatever. Okay, so then all of a sudden here comes Rick Johnson. Well, who do I got to beat to be good? Well, Rick Johnson. Well, Brock Glover. Okay, well, you know, Rick Johnson. Well, Ronnie Lachine comes along from El Cajon. Who do I got to beat? Well, my local guy to beat is this guy named Rick Johnson, and he used to beat Brock Glover, so I'm going to beat Rick Johnson. So all of a sudden, these guys in the same little neighborhood all of a sudden are beat, you know, world beaters. And how did that happen? Because that's what bar was set in our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. But you went back some other part of the country, well, they didn't have a Marty Smith or a Brock Glover or a Rick Johnson to aim for. They didn't achieve that same level. So I feel that some of it's, you know, some of that's just what it is. I mean, you know, when a 360 or a single backflip was the bar, then someone's like, well, if a guy can do a backflip, how can he do two? Or can he do this?
They're doing three or four. Now.
It's like just insanity. It's absolutely crazy. And it's just, everything's been elevated like that. I'm just glad I'm done with all that. I'm happy with the era I grew up in. I got a great lot of war stories. Like I said, with guys like Danny talked about, but I don't want to be any part of that.
Do you follow the racing? I know we talked the other week and you were ready to watch the race.
I watch all of them. Yeah, it's fun. My wife and I watch.
What's your overall thoughts on it? I mean,
I was just thinking about the track design, things like that to make it more, make it maybe a little bit more fun, maybe mix it up a bit. Because a lot of times, sometimes the tracks are similar. See, I look back, I see, wow, the jump, they still have the same hoops. They still have the same basic things. So I like what I was thinking of. You know what you need to do? I think you need a straightaway where it has bumps like moguls. Moguls. Well, round mogul bumps, big, you know, one, and put them in real random, so there's nothing.
They do that at Daytona. That's kind of what they do in spots in Daytona because it's more of a natural environment.
So you know how a line when you're skiing, you have a mogul there, a mogul there, they're offset, so you can't make one line. So everyone. It mixes up. I like that they do try to do different things, you know, to see, because otherwise it's like a video game, you know. Now you have to memorize a track. You do this, you do that. You know, everyone's memorizing now. Everyone's videos.
They race the track and not race each other, right? I mean, I find that happens a lot. There's racing the track, but they're not racing
they
each other.
They use terminology like hit the marks. It's just like. Okay, it's like, okay, if he hits his every mark, I'm going to hit every mark, and then I'm going
to
do a perfect race.
I want him to race a guy. I want him to pass somebody and do that. I don't care if he hits his mark or whatever.
A big difference, I'd like to see some tracks built like they were back in your day, a little bit awkward takeoffs, steeper, whoops that are big, small,
that's
big,
what
small,
the,
big.
Some of the wall faces and stuff, that's kind of a little bit what they are, that they've done that. But I can tell you, I wouldn't want the job of building the tracks like they do nowadays, but when they miss, they miss. I mean, it's like, out of Arlington, one was okay. I walked about 10 laps into the main event. I walked out to our truck and said, I'm going to help to start loading up and doing our stuff because it was so boring. Like, there was no passing going on. And then the last round three at Arlington, wow, phenomenal. I couldn't get enough, and I was stared and I couldn't watch enough of the track at the same time. It was fantastic. So there's no question, and again, I'm not pointing fingers and blaming, these guys don't know what they're doing. It's hard to do, but when they get it right, there's no sport like it.
No, I agree.
And, like, it was – the Arlington 3 was fantastic.
It was a good race.
I go back and watch 90 Atlanta or 92 Tampa. Like, anytime I need to just see what a good race looks like.
Yeah.
And if you don't remember those races.
Yep.
No, you got to put stuff in there that it's more random. They know what's coming. They practice on the tracks. Everything is known. Yeah. They've done it already.
They've done it a billion times.
Yeah,
stock supercross triple.
To me, that's why I like the idea of going to a track you've never, ever been before in your life and figuring it out and winning on it.
Now,
that's kind of like, that's why I thought I like the GPs. Because in supercross, it's like, these guys all have, they know the height, the size, the depth, everything. They know it's like a video, it's really like a, you know, yeah, memorization video game.
You're right. Yeah.
And there's nothing random about it. So
I think the Dirtworks guys would take a ton of heat, but if they made just some weird stuff to throw guys out of the
room. Who would they get the heat from?
The riders. Riders. The riders would bitch and moan.
So they dictate what they're going to ride on?
If it's not the way.
I know. I'm joking. I know they do that.
You throw them out of their element. Trust me, is that so.
Oh, wait a minute. That's not fair.
I know. So my question I have on my note here was your opinion. Where do you see, I mean, I know nobody's Nostradamus here, and they're going to be clairvoyant with the future of the sport, but EV bikes and motocross. I mean, obviously we see it now in the KTM, KJSC, where they run into little junior crosses on the 50s electrics, and we know about electric bikes and all that stuff. But what's your thoughts on the future of the sport and EV bikes?
I got to ride one in Italy. I think you were at the last one I was at. Mm-hmm. The guy had the carbon fiber electric, whatever. What's his name? Yeah.
We both rode that bike.
Right.
It had a clutch, full transmission, and a full EV bike.
It was probably the lightest one out there, probably.
It was a little overkill. I don't think you really absolutely need a full transmission and a clutch and all that stuff. An EV bike, it's really not necessary.
But for racing on a supercross track, the type of power that it winds up and makes, you may not be able to do the same obstacles for safety wise. There's just no way. It doesn't replicate the same type of power that you feel when you come on a turn and you accelerate and it ramps up the power. Mm-hmm. How it ramps up and builds power shoots you out of the turn. So the sport would have to change. It just doesn't make that kind of power. Yeah. It's not the same.
But we've seen it be competitive in straight rhythm. We've seen them be competitive in the straight rhythm.
When you're pretty much it's getting better for sure. And they'll design the type of power that probably meets those requirements I'm talking with. Yeah. But anyway, I rode one around also in Italy a couple of years ago on an enduro bike, and the more you twist the throttle, the next moment it makes less power. I mean, the power level goes down really rapidly.
Acceleration rate.
Once you hit peak speed, that's it.
Right. I meant like one lap, it's got full power. The next lap, it's got less.
Diminishes. Total output diminishes. Okay.
Yeah. So if a pro level rider gets on a bike, let's say what it exists today, and says, okay, go do 20 laps wide open. Well, he's going to notice that right away. It's just going down.
Devil's advocate, I will say the last rendition of Alta's bike did not do that.
Oh, really?
It maintained 90-95% of the power until it got right down to your last little battery light, and then it went into limp mode. But
it was disappointing.
They're getting better at that. It's dissipating heat and all. They got some hurdles still, but I worry. Let's just say they figured it out, and the power's great, and the batteries are good. You can either swap them or whatever. Are you going to sit in the stands?
Listen, I know.
And just hear, you know, like.
But even back.
No smell, no vibration, no sound.
I'm still stuck on the thing. Okay, if you go out and ride a 4-hour loop in the mountains.
Yeah. Off-road, it's challenging for sure in the off-road. Right, but we're talking pure racing, supercross, motocross.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe they have to do 20 minutes. Maybe they have to modify the traction and stuff. But I'm with you. It's like the excitement level. There's nothing like watching, you know, 20, 22 bikes come to a first corner in supercross race and to hear that sound and they launch off to the gate.
But have
it all go. Zzz, zzz, and it's like, oh, come on, please.
It'll kill our sport if they try to do that.
All you hear is the chain slopping against the nylon blocks.
It's nice that little kids can take, KTM and the Husky and all. It's really, really nice that they can take a bike like that. And you can literally put your kid on a 50cc bike and what would be equivalent to a 50 or a small bike and then go and have him actually riding on a piece of property that could be in your backyard or whatever other than the dust. You know, you're not going to get a lot of complaints. So it's going to hopefully bring people to our sport.
Yeah.
But that next step, it's going to be interesting.
I think there's a niche for it. If they try to push it into racing and get rid of internal combustion engines, which is what they're essentially trying to do here in California. Yeah.
Well, the MotoGP runs that Moto E series. And their racing is fantastic, but it is horrible to watch because it's just silent.
Yeah, it is.
I thought Midwest or up north, you could get one of those big covered areas, where they'll have tracks right now, but you got to vent the exhaust and it's got issues. Man, you could have music playing, a little you know, like concessions area.
It's top golf for supercross.
Right. Well, exactly. Right now you see all, you know, the EV, all the little bicycles, you know, and then they're morphing into like little motorcycles. You see, mm-hmm. it's happening already. You get these, all the kids, bigger wheels, bigger mm-hmm. suspension, you know, so they're morphing into little motorcycles all the time. Kids, yeah. So it's going to probably open up another, you know, like the city people come back to maybe riding, you know, yeah. dirt bikes now.
I mean, exactly. There you go. I mean, Davis.
In a field, yeah. any field you can yeah. find now, you go indoor, ride. No one complains about it too much.
Yeah, indoor. Well, they did it at the Straight Rhythm when the KTM had their little EV bikes there. They had them in, honestly, what was a horse corral kind of a thing. So yeah. Can you imagine indoor riding rinks in an urban area where you've got an indoor riding rink and you don't even have to worry about exhaust, you know, venting the exhaust fumes and things like that.
So we can go ride Adams Gulch with electric bikes.
That's right, yeah. exactly.
Yeah.
Well, I think the Alta was a little ahead of its time. It didn't really, uh-huh. they need to do it like what Stasic and even what KTM are doing is mm-hmm. start kids off, right? The Stasic's yeah. got kids now that are 2 and 3 that are, electric is all they know. Yeah. They move up to that 60 oh, or yeah. whatever they're calling that thing. Yeah. Now they're used to electric, and then there'll be an 80. Do you know what I'm saying?
No, as the yeah. development
and
increases.
So those kids get used to electric, and that's all they know.
They yeah. already have the what was equivalent kind of to a 50, and they've already got yeah. the motor. That's sort of like in Cobra's already coming out with their version of it. That's like, wait a minute, we got a limit for the 50 class at Loretta Lynn's. We got to limit it to 0.9 or 1.0. Yeah. Then you got to 1.6, and then pretty soon, and then this, you know, parents are going to throw a 1.6 or a 2.0 engine in a kid's 50, yeah. and you're going to kill the kid. But the point is, it's like we need the governor. We put a governor on the parents.
On the parents,
but
yeah.
it's just, it's certainly going to be interesting when you're going to see EV classes at Loretta's and things like that.
Well, yeah. and as a guy who works at FMF, I've asked Mitch about this. Mm-hmm. What's Pro Circuit stance? Like, if this happens,
what are you going to do?
What are you going to do? And he goes, I'll just probably close up shop. He's like, yeah. I'm not going to, yeah. I mean, that's, yeah. Pipes yeah, I mean, and silencers and motors, that's what we do. I guess I'm not going to learn electric. Yeah. I already made the switch to 4-stroke.
Yeah, there's a lot of of bikes out there, you know, that are we still build stuff for that are 20 years ago. Guys yeah. still riding, yeah. you know, 1990, 2000. There's a lot of guys out yeah. there still riding bikes, motorcycles. Yeah. So, yeah. But, you know, as long as they're out there, there'll still be a demand a little bit for that stuff. But, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's a huge dent in aftermarket companies.
Yeah, they don't have a modern bike doesn't yeah. have. Yeah, you can't sell anything that's been built in the last 10 years. It's a tough. And then you're going to go to the vintage.
Swim. Yeah, I think right now there'll be a while. Like yeah. we were talking about the battery life, and
I think we're a decade stuff. Away or more. What was the guess?
Oh, I don't know. It's hard to say.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you said, the little guys starting on those as they grow up. They'll keep developing that way. So
that's the demand,
count the
right?
years.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You can kind of probably count
well, that's
those
scary because that's not long then. No. You're talking you already got 60 level kids on them and used to them.
Yep.
And they've already, you're talking a few more, 5 more years.
They're already having the power plant signing right now. I mean, I had the discussion in Arlington about this with the KTM people.
And is that right?
Yeah, they got the power plant for what was a 50? And you got a 60, and then you've got your 50 and 60, and then 85. They've got the power plant already.
I think for the off-road world, yeah, I think it'll be a lot. You know, as long as they allow motors, I think they'll mm-hmm. still be in the motor shop because of refueling for fuel for it. Go, you know, you for having to charge a battery or mm-hmm. to have another recharge or you know for enduro for right. in desert riding for adventure riding. I think it'd be a while for me,
the practicality of it all, I just wish I would wish they would pursue a cleaner burning 2-stroke with the continuation yeah. of EFI and the direct injection and all the things that they have been able to really make clean, you know, efficient. Like in snowmobiling, there was a big trend for 4-strokes for a while, but they're all back to 2-strokes now. Yeah. Same outboards, kind of the same situation was happening. So I think I wish we did that in our. And the reason that for me personally is just that the 4-stroke is so darn expensive for maintenance, and to get a real good high performance 4-stroke, I mean, to campaign a 250F at a high level racing right now is just. You might as well just, you know, it's mortgage, you know, you might as well be a bank. I mean, it's just hard for, you know, the average person to do that and then to expect parents to, you know, every parent wants their kid to have the best stuff and to do the best they can most of the time. And you know, you just hate to see parents have to spend the kind of money they do with the 4-stroke.
Yeah, that's true.
I think when the tide will change is when you see a Yamaha and you know they've got electric motors. They know what they're doing. They're sitting on it. Honda kind of flashed theirs out a couple years ago, mm-hmm. but they've still been holding that close to their chest. So mm-hmm. when they finally launch one, I think that's it. That's going to be the end of it.
Yeah,
my personal opinion, unfortunately.
Yeah.
What do you do for fun now, outside of just riding? I know you still ride a little bit here and there, but
yeah, just mostly riding.
Yeah, sort of fun. That's your outlet.
No, I just travel to Europe usually once or twice a year. We did this little thing with Brock a couple of years ago. The Transburger. I've done some other events as well in Europe, you know, little things. But and then mostly just going vacation. My wife's, you know, originally from France, so we go to southern France and hang out there for a little while. And so I really don't have, you know, any hobbies, you know. Well,
still work at FMF.
And working at FMF.
He works at FMF. That's a daily deal. And working with Donnie and trying to keep up with him, that's not an easy thing. He breathes, dreams, everything. Still to this day, motorcycles. That's
absolutely.
He's so passionate about motorcycles. I think that's what he wakes up in the middle of the night thinking, I got to write this down. I got an idea for something.
Yeah.
He's still that enthusiastic about that all these years.
Yeah, he is. He's
fantastic.
And he loves racing. He loves all kinds of racing.
And that's what's so cool
and he
about
loves,
it.
Yeah.
To have somebody like that so passionate about it and think about it, and he's been doing it since the night. You know,
yeah, so it's never boring. Yeah.
You know. What's your title over there? What do you do?
Well, I really don't have a title, which is good. You know, I work with Donnie, and he always needs a hand in the back, and I've done worked on different projects along the way, but pretty much just whatever we need, which is really fun, is
your
development
guy
stuff in the dyno room, working on bikes. You know, that's kind of the interesting stuff.
Yeah.
But you know, running a place like that needs just normal, you know, hands-on stuff. Donnie's hands-on. He goes to work and he puts up his sleeves and he's into everything. It doesn't matter. That machine, he's working on machines all day long. So
He's not the guy just to sit in his office and make calls and push a pen around. No.
Well, he calls, but it's usually somebody about a machine or but nothing about, you know.
How's your body held up? Do you have any of those, like that broken femur or anything from that big crash?
I've been really lucky. So any of the young guys out there, they'll have a...
Both knees?
No, yeah, I actually had one full knee replacement. Yeah,
you do?
Yeah.
How was that?
Yeah.
Good. I don't even... You know, I limped on it for maybe 4 or 5 years, just pain.
Do you remember me giving you a hard time? Yeah, it's funny. Go ahead.
So I had a full knee replacement done about 5 years ago, and literally... In a month, almost forgot about I ever had a knee problem.
Is that right?
There was a point though. There, I was talking, Danny, you're still. He goes, I know. I still I've trained myself to limp a little bit, and it's just how my gait has become. I have to train. I don't need to limp, but I got to get rid of it. And then he's
got back problems too.
No, he's gotten rid of it finally. But first few months, I remember even when you were kind of pretty healthy and you could ride and do all your stuff, he was still kind of limping because that's just what he had done for so many years.
Like your gangster limp.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah. Well, yeah, but it's
no, it's really funny though. They're amazing, you know. So
I got a buddy that got one and he was so bone on bone. He woke up from the surgery and he was like, oh, the pain's gone. The first thing he said.
Oh.
And I was like, wow, right out of surgery?
Yeah, that it can get that bad, yeah. Sometimes you wake up and it's stuck in a position or stick. I never really didn't have constant pain, but it just limited, you know, your movement and everything. So now I got full extension and it's,
well,
it's
I'm heading
good.
That direction, so I'll probably hit you up for advice. But
don't be afraid. The products get better and the way they do the operations now are amazing.
Yeah. I'm not so quite there yet, but I will be. I mean,
by the time you need it, you're going to have, I mean, the technology, like I said, it's just like one of those things where the longer you wait for that kind of stuff, the better.
Literally,
that's what I'm hoping.
You're an outpatient now. Well, full knee.
That's crazy.
Yeah, crazy.
Did you get a video of it? It's a horrible surgery.
No, I saw them on YouTube.
How big of a rubber mallet do they use to bang it in there and all that? Yeah.
It's like a 15-pound sledge, and they just start banging and sawing. It looks like a construction site.
It's a lot better than it used to be.
It is,
but
terrible.
Yeah, cut off saw. No, yep, exactly.
And what about retiring? I don't know if you strike me as the kind of guy who would retire and enjoy just being a man of leisure.
No.
Are you kind of guy that needs to stay busy?
I'm pretty good at it.
Oh, yeah? All right.
No, I mean, yeah. What do you do? I mean, after you race, you know, motorcycles, and you still ride. Riding's still a lot of fun.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not going to fly a plane. I'm not a pilot. I'm not, you know.
Yeah.
I'll go see Greg Arnett to do that, you know, and hang out with him or somebody, or John Gregory.
Yeah,
fly around.
Don't fly with John.
But you in Georgia, that you still enjoy traveling.
Oh yeah,
you
we have like to travel.
Two
I love
kids,
to travel.
Two
yeah.
kids living abroad. Right. You've got grandkids. As soon as this darn COVID, they spend a lot of time in Europe and
yeah,
and,
yeah. Have, no, we go to we'll go to yeah. tennis tournaments.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you got one. Yeah, your daughter. Son is living in
Oslo,
Norway. Yeah.
And he has a little boy, and my daughter lives in London. So she works for the Women's Tennis Association. So she gets to go to all the. You'll see her come and grab players off the after they, someone wins Wimbledon or something, and she'll grab them and take them to do some interviews and things with different various.
Yeah, what things. A cool job. She was a tennis player, so that's like dream job for her.
Yeah, it is. It really is. It's a dream job. Exactly. Yeah. So we'll chase them around a little bit. Go to hang out at Wimbledon someday.
I know, it's kind of funny. Danny's like Shane is played at a high level, professional tennis level, and teaches it, and how to Laporte kids have coming from a grandfather who jumped out of airplanes, Army Ranger motocross, Montessa riding grandpa, and then you got Danny who raced motocross all the time, to two tennis players.
Yeah. I think I kind of guided him that way.
Yeah, he did. Danny always, when Danny raced, I would see, Danny would occasionally on the day before a race or something just be out there killing time playing a little tennis and sometimes with Roger or whoever. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Danny liked to play tennis.
Huh. That's
that was
cool.
A hack, tennis hack.
Yep.
So this is kind of our last question we ask all of our guests is, how do you want to be remembered in this sport?
I don't know. Just probably on the things that I've done, basically, because I always can't even hear myself, but, just being able to do all the things that I've done has been, for myself personally, is an achievement. I had some goals in motocross. I got to those. And then I did some off-road stuff. I did everything. I kind of was really fortunate, So I really... And I look back and I go, wow, I've done a little bit of everything, which is great, And I think a lot of the riders now you see some of the guys doing the same thing that I did. I think what's his name? Short, he started doing the rallies, So yeah. I don't know. Is he still? He's still on it. He's still.
What continent? Yeah. What continent have you not been on? Right, Antarctica. Yeah. Maybe, that's it, huh? Probably. Huh?
No, Antarctica. Yeah. But it's been a lot of fun to try to change, to do something else and make a living from it for a while. Mm-hmm. But the Baja stuff was pretty much for free.
Yeah,
that was my training
contributions
grounds to get to Africa.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But and motivate. Yeah, it was after you quit motocross, you want to try to get some more income, keep coming in. And that's part of it as well, the attraction of going at the time, especially racing in Africa. After I was hearing that some of the rally guys were making more than the motocross guys in that era. Yeah. So, I think it's just, I just enjoyed every little aspect of motorcycle riding. I enjoy it today.
Well, what you've accomplished to me is like, incredible. And I, like I said, I kind of knew, but as I started diving into this, I'm like, wow. And I didn't even know about the ISDE gold medal.
Yeah.
So that's like another feather in your cap.
No,
but you
know.
Have accomplished some incredible things, man. Like your diversity is just wild. But, but the thing that stands out the most to me, every person I ever ask about you, oh man, Danny's great. What a nice guy. No one has anything bad to say about you. People that
Well, that's a good thing.
That's maybe the best compliment, man, that anyone could pay.
Yeah, thanks.
So,
yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah. Well,
Mr. Nice Guy. Oh, that's what Patrick Boulon used to say. Remember Pat? Mr.
Nice
Guy.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. Funny French guy.
Danny
yeah.
the Door. They called you.
Oh. Yeah.
Because Laporte does it.
Yeah. Yeah, but anyway, nice doesn't always win.
Well, it won a national and a world title.
That's right.
No,
and an ISD gold medal. And
And three Baja. No.
And three Baja 1000 and a rally of a world title.
Had such a great memory of all this different stuff. It's really fortunate to be able to have been in the motorcycle industry. To go everywhere.
To me, honestly, Danny, I mean, besides all the what we talked about, nice guy and all that stuff, and you've traveled the world and you've got to meet people from, you have a lot of friends, or acquaintances around the world, and you're really rich in that aspect. The fact that all the people that you've known and come into contact with, and from all sorts of walks,
and we're still friends. Can you believe that?
Can you?
No
can
one
you
would. No
that?
One know that. Though.
Unbelievable.
I can pick up the phone anytime and talk to Brock. From politics to
whatever, it
doesn't
is.
Matter.
We try not to go that. No, okay. Let's not go
that's
there.
That's a long conversation.
That's another conversation. But yeah, just in general friendship, and we have honestly, it's yeah. we've done so many things in our past, and it's. I couldn't be more honored to be asked to even be sitting here
no,
during
but,
your.
You know, but yeah. really, I think a lot of. I mean, I respect all your competitors. You have to respect your. If you don't respect your competitors, you know, I don't know. I no matter how. Wacky we all could be, you know, yeah. at different times. It's just, yeah. but everyone reacts under pressure differently, you know. Yeah. So, yeah. but you gotta give the guys a pat on the back for just getting out there and throwing their leg over a motorcycle.
And if they're on the track with you, racing against you, they've accomplished a lot
exactly.
just to get there. You know that.
Yeah. Well, I'll just tell you though, not a lot of people can do that, and I'm one of them. You know, throughout my racing career, there was people I hated.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
I'm sure, yeah. I don't know, were you the same way? Did you have some guys you just...
I never bought into that, you know, you got to hate your competitor.
The hate, yeah.
And Danny probably had the same philosophy. I didn't. I trust me, I look back at some of the rivals that I had, and we talked about one, like Mark Barnett. Yeah, he got me out of the bed in the morning because I knew he was training hard.
So but there's no hate.
But there wasn't hate. There no. was never hate. Yeah. And I love Mark and Barnett. He's a great guy, and Danny and I didn't have hate for
I think all the guys get a little emotional. This is an intense sport.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you're think about it. It's gnarly. I mean, these guys going in, you could get taken out and break a guy's leg and or worse. You know, you have a lot of responsibility in your hands.
You race against some people that you realize that's about what they were after with you. You didn't want to, you know, they weren't fun to race against. But, you know, Danny raced hard. He raced you know, as physically as you kind of needed to be, but he never was, you know, never raced anybody dirty or any of that stuff. And there were plenty of guys out there that pulled that stuff. But
yeah, but I have to say, Brock, there's a couple times I was kind of dirty, you know. I didn't mean it. I'm sorry about it.
Okay. You apologize now?
I've T-boned a few guys.
Once in a while, you got to hit somebody, you know?
Sometimes you race aggressively and you bump into somebody, But you, yeah.
Now we analyze stuff to the nth degree, like, you know, on these blogs. Did you see that pass?
Did he brake check him?
No. I think his elbow touched him.
I think so. Well, I don't know.
Well, I am just honored to call you a friend, man. And I appreciate you taking
the
time today.
Too.
And thank you, Brock, so much for coming on and sitting in here with us.
That was fun.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Thanks a lot. Right.
Thank you,
Dave. Again. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Brock. Thanks for being here.
You got it, brother. Yeah. Thank you for asking me. Honestly,
oh, my gosh. It's an honor to sit here and just listen to you two talk. So a lot of fun.
Thanks.
All right. Well, hey, stay tuned. That was Danny Laporte's show. We'll be right back to wrap it up. I want to be bad with you, girl, like we're robbing a bank. I want to be mad at the world like it took you away. Don't want to be mad at myself. And that's our show. I want to just thank our sponsors one more time as we head out. Again, couldn't do this without them. Yamaha, making incredible products from motorcycles, ATVs, side-by-sides, whatever you're in the market for, please start at your Yamaha dealer and give those guys a look. Unmatched reliability. These guys build the best motocross bikes. They're dominating in the adventure market with the Tenere. They just do an awesome job at everything they build. So we encourage you guys to check those out. PowerDot, thank you to them. This is an incredible device for injury prevention and maintenance. Just stress relief. It actually has a massage mode. They've got butterfly patches that lay across your whole low back. I mean, motocross guys, whether you're young or old, you're going to run into some back pain issues. That's one of those things that happens with our sport. So go to PowerDot, 20% off using our code WhiskeyThrottle, no spaces or capitals. Method Race Wheels, same story, 20% off on a set of wheels. It's pretty significant savings. Just type in the code WhiskeyThrottle at checkout, and they make the fastest, lightest, strongest wheels in off-road and in a bunch of cool styles, so check them out. Troy Lee Designs, again, limited edition gear coming through, so be sure to check that out, the Overload Camo, as well as everything else they've got to offer. SKDA, amazing design work these guys are doing. This is a really, really cool Australian company, and we're just so stoked to be partnered up with them. Whether you want to just pick something they've got or you can design something with them, have their team work with you to build something you like, they make great stuff. High quality, amazing customer service, and really cool next level design. Dunlop Tires, big thank you to those guys. They dominate. I mean, last every single title in the last 10 years. I mean, these guys just win. These tires are the best motocross tires you can buy right now. And they support this sport 100% start to finish. So let's thank them for that. Pro Circuit, these guys race and they win. And if you're looking for better suspension, exhaust systems, they've got slip-ons, full tie systems, pistons, engine work, hard parts, you name it, Pro Circuit has it. And they are race-tested and race-proven. Nihilo Concepts, get over and look at everything these guys have, man. Their product line is growing so quickly. But some key products I use on a lot of my bike builds, the lever grip, which is just a real thin shrink wrap rubber finish on your levers. It just gives it a nice feel, keeps your fingers warmer in cold weather. I just like the feel of it. Very, very cool. The frame tape is awesome. It's super affordable. They've got the secondary on switch, which if you're an off-road guy, this is a nice little insurance policy to have. But they've got carbon fiber stuff, they've got titanium stuff, all billet. It's really, really well made, really cool product. So go over to Nihilo Concepts, check those guys out. Seat Concepts, the saddle, man, you don't know how comfortable a seat can be until you ride with a good one. Hit up Seat Concepts the next time you're in the market. If you ride in a lot of inclement weather, they have seats that are designed for that are waterproof, that won't break down if you're riding a lot of water, rain, stuff like that. They make snowmobile seats. They're jumping into all kinds of markets. They will also build something custom for you, or you can just buy a replacement seat. But I promise you, either way, it'll be the most comfortable seat you've ever ridden on. Senna Bluetooth. These guys are making incredible products. They will make a ride more fun, whether it's an adventure ride, a street ride, you're motoing or dual sporting with your buddies. Get one of the 50S systems. Sticks right into your helmet, mounts easily, and you can communicate back and forth. No buttons to push, whatever, you just talk. And it makes riding so much more fun. It adds a whole nother layer to it that you never knew you really needed. And from a safety or training perspective, again, if you've got a kid on the track, you can throw on a headset and talk to them in real time, warn them of downed riders, unsafe issues, or just say, hey, your line sucks right here. Change it, you know, as you come around a turn. So it's very, very beneficial to be able to talk to them in real time and keep them safe and help them to learn quicker and faster. Pro X, big fan of these products. These guys Pro Circuit uses these. A lot of top GP teams use their products. It is OEM standards, okay, in terms of durability at a more affordable price. And a lot of times they improve off of the OEM. With their sprockets, they've got little cleaning grooves, things like that. So they do improve upon them, but it's just a way of providing replacement parts at a much more affordable price. So go over to ProX and check them out. Everything from chains and sprockets, brake pads, cables, brake rebuild kits, top ends, bottom ends, you name it, they've got it. ProX will rebuild your whole bike, so check them out. Stasic, super big believer in this brand and this company. Ryan and the guys over there, Matt, are doing an awesome job taking a product to market that could save our sport. I mean, this is a finally getting kids from a very young age off of video games and whatever the hell else they're doing now and back on motorcycles. I think it's a first step in rebuilding a good grassroots foundation for our sport. So if you've got young ones, check these things out. They're amazing. Motul USA, we talked a little bit about Rally today, and Motul was the winning team with Ricky Brabeck. 2 years ago, won the Paris to Dakar rally. And you don't do that with crappy products. Motul is very, very high level. They compete in motorsports at the highest level and win. And we're stoked to have them on board. I've been using a bunch of their just bike wash products, chain wash, chain lube, contact cleaner, and it's awesome. I'm loving it. OGO Power Sports, best bags in the biz. If you're looking for a gear bag, hydration pack, fanny pack, gear bag, man, whatever. They make all of it. It's awesome. Go check out OGO_PowerSports or OGOPowerSports.com. Specialized bicycles. If you've not seen the new Levo, the Gen 3 Levo, this thing is absolutely next level. You can take a peek on my social media page to have some looks at that, or go over to Specialized.com and get a good look at it. It's incredible. really taking things to a whole nother level. And those are our sponsors. I just want to encourage everyone to get over to WhiskeyThrottleShow.com. We've got a bunch of new shirts on there, including the new Steve Caballero shirt, hats, t-shirts, flasks. We got all kinds of stuff coming in. Cool new design. So get over there and check us out. Support the show. We sure appreciate it. Thank you guys so much for supporting the show. We appreciate you watching and listening. And we've got great shows coming. Stay tuned. Have a great day. See you soon. One by one,
just tell me when the end. Thanks for watching the Whiskey Throttle Show. Don't forget to like and subscribe and click the bell to get alerts for all the latest content. Follow us on Twitter at @W_Throttle_Show and on TikTok, Facebook, and Instagram at Whiskey Throttle Show. He won't stop until the job is done.